horsepower. Getting right into the spirit of things now on BBC Two, all the build-up, all the excitement of the day's racing at Aintree with Sue Barker and Claire Balding and Grand National Grandstand.
It's one of the biggest sporting events in the world. It's something that every jockey wants to win, no matter who you are, no matter how many races you have won.
It's a fantasy with kids growing up.
Red Rum is going to win the national!
I think everybody has dreams of maybe riding the national.
It is a magical race. It's absolutely unique. There is no other race in the world like it. It's part of this country.
What goes with the national is nothing that I've ever experienced before or after. It is massive.
I love the build-up to it.
The buzz when they come out of that weighing room.
I love the start of it.
You can hear the roar, the crowd.
It's great to be able to take part in it.
Words can't describe how you feel.
Some staging are going to get it wrong, and the horse has to be able to get it right.
To get round and finish, that is an achievement.
Because you never know what can happen.
If I could say, I rode around Liverpool, that would be the peak of any horseman's career.
It's every jockey's dream doing the Grand National.
It's the greatest feeling you'll ever experience.
Big day has arrived. This afternoon sees the running of the 157th Grand National, the greatest steeplechase of them all. Welcome to Aintree, a course which evokes great excitement, tradition and anticipation. The Martel Cognac Grand National is a race that can make heroes out of brave jockeys and legends out of extraordinary horses. Such is the appeal of this great sporting occasion that 70,000 people are expected here today. But it's not just for racing enthusiasts, it's for everyone looking for a memorable day out. A magical atmosphere and emotional scenes are guaranteed here today as 40 courageous horses and riders will take on the grueling 4.5 mile challenge over 30 fences. Some have become household names, like this one, Beecher's Brook. And the biggest fence on the course, the chair, 5'2" with a 6-foot span. This will be jumped just once in front of the main stands.
And the reason for that is that by the time they get here on the second circuit, that is their last fence, away there in the distance. These tapes will be taken away and they have to come out onto this side of the course to get past the chair. That's why it's called the elbow. They then have the longest run-in anywhere in the world, and fortunes can really change between here and the winning post. It's 440 yards over 1/4 mile from the last fence to the winning line. 2 years ago, What's Up Boys looked like he got it won at this point. Bindery came back and did him. Last year, Monty's Pass was cruising. Nothing else could get near him. This year, with ground that I think is pretty good ground, we could have still 4 or 5 horses in contention at the elbow, and everything will then be down to their ability to quicken up and accelerate away to the line.
To win the Grand National, horse must be brave, bold, a sound jumper with the stamina of a marathon runner to be a supreme athlete. The stage is set here for the real stars to shine.
Thank you.
well, the horses must arrive here fit, fresh and ready to run a big race. That is what the trainers are aiming for, and throughout the afternoon we'll hear from the people in the know. Including John Joe O'Neill. He never got round as a jockey, but that hasn't soured his enthusiasm for the big race. He trains two of the favourites. Martin Pipe, the champion trainer for 13 years, has six runners in the National. Scoo went back to visit his old boss. From the top of the pile to the man who would be king, Alan King, out to make his mark in Grand National history today with Bear on board. What's up, boys? Second in the National 2 years ago, then 16 months away from the track. Philip Hobbs had the tough job to get him fit in time. And we'll be reporting from the home of the current champion, Monty's Pass. 12 months ago, he was given a hero's welcome on his return to Connor in Ireland. Today, we will get reaction from his fans as he attempts to do the double.
God, it is absolutely tipping down with rain out there. I just timed that bit on the course to perfection. But heavy rain like that just might start to make a difference, and that can change the betting and the whole plan of the race and the whole outcome of it. Standing alongside me, a man who rode in 10 Grand Nationals, completed 7 of them, finished 2nd on Melimos. This is Norman Williamson.
Absolutely.
Oh, it's horrible.
Yeah, but it's just going to change. It'll change the betting, change the result, everything. Because if the ground has been watered, this will probably get into it. And we're still, listen, it's going to be a great race.
Does it make it any worse for the jockeys? I mean, you've got waterproof breeches you can put on over your normal jumpers, but what about your hands slipping and your feet slipping in the irons?
Well, one riding today, Mick Fitzgerald, would ride in anything or go around anywhere, but he hates rain. And it's not nice because the reins are slipping from your hands and the stick and everything else, but listen, it's the same for everybody.
And this is not a course that you want your reins slipping over. We have a global audience for the Grand National of over 700 million people. It makes you feel very tiny, especially when you consider we're just in a little country, in a little place on the northwest coast of the UK, Aintree Racecourse on the outskirts of Liverpool. And this is the course for the Grand National. 4.5 miles, 30 fences. And Norman, the first thing to encounter is this very long run from the start to the first fence.
Yes, almost, I'd say over 2 furlongs to the first, and it rides a little bit downhill. You're crossing the road here. Now it's time to get your horse back onto his hocks for the first fence. You have a huge crowd on the right hand side from this view, and really I think a lot of the horses, they're going too quick, and there's a drop at the back, and you very simple to fall there. Second fence is quite simple. Now the third fence here has the big ditch. That's a real big test. Rides as big as the chair. And moving on here to Beechers.
If you get over that little bushes on the left here, tell you you're coming to the sixth fence. This is Beechers Brook. We saw a lot of fallers here yesterday because they went down the inside where the drop is greater.
Yes, people, like you said, with the hedges, people that won't have been around here a lot, the hedges will tell them time to get worried. Smallest fence on the track next with a tricky one on a bit of a turn. A lot of horses get afraid of Beechers and can refuse at that. Now you have the canal turn, a right angle, back to the left. So people, we saw Mick Fitzgerald yesterday trying to cut the corner. He paid the penalty, but it's a hell of a fence. You have to be very, very clever, and the horse has to be clever. You straighten up along here. You have a ditch at the back of this one. Quite an easy fence to jump, actually. Horses are settled and into a rhythm at this stage.
And you're about halfway around the first circuit at this stage, so you're trying to get the horses settled. You'll have lost a few runners in the race. You're just trying to let the horses start to enjoy themselves.
Yes, and back onto the man-made track here and heading back towards the second last. A lot of fallers at this fence over the past few years. I don't know why, but there has been. This will be the last fence next time round. Now we're heading up to the chair.
First time round, then? That's the only time they negotiate the chair. I was saying earlier, what a big spread there is on this, but generally speaking, horses jump it well.
Jump it well. It rides a little bit uphill the last 4 strides, and horses seem to jump it real well. And again, horses can make a mistake at the next, which is the water jump. Well, this really is the smallest fence on the track, but you have the water at the back, and horses get afraid at the chair and don't handle that so well. And now it's time to chat to your pals all around you and head off and do the same again if you can.
And off you go on the second circuit. That's where the race really starts to develop, and when you jump the last, you've still got that long old run in. It really is the most spectacular event because of the nature of these fences. They are unlike anything you will ever see on any race course in Britain, Ireland, France, or anywhere in the world.
This is where you were explaining earlier, Claire, up the long, long running, and we've seen it change so many times up here, and with so many runners again today, I think we could have a shock result.
And before anyone starts sending in emails, Norman did point out to me that is not the longest run in anywhere in the world, because...
I believe Cartmel is. It's I think it's 4.5 furlongs from the last fence in Cartmel. So.
I stand corrected. I'm sure there will be plenty more mistakes made over the afternoon. As long as we're still smiling at the end of it, it doesn't matter. One person certainly smiling, because he always is, is Rishi Prasad. I don't know whether he's in the rain or he's got some cover.
It's because I've got cover, Claire. Looking behind me, the rain and the wind absolutely belting it down at the moment, putting a dampener on proceedings, but not on enthusiasm, because today is the big day. It's the 157th running of the Martel Cognac Grand National. Of course, that's the highlight, but there are three terrific supporting races, starting at 1:45 with the Martel Cordon Bleu handicap hurdle over 2.5 miles a furlong. Limerick Boy, who won here at this meeting last year, he'll be out to put a disappointing run at Cheltenham behind him. Tony Dobbin takes over from the injured Sam Thomas. At 2:20, the pace picks up with some of the fastest two-mile novice chasers in the country. Paul Nichols may hold the key with This, That and T'other and Ven Ottery. Joe Tizard takes over from the injured Ruby Walsh on This, That and T'other. In the 2:55, the Martel Cognac Aintree Hurdle, one of jump racing's favourite grades, Rooster Boosters, on show, and he'll be hoping to better his second place last year. And then, of course, it's the big one, the main event. The Grand National over 4.5 miles, in which 40 runners and riders will be chasing their place in racing history. Couple of horses who won't be making racing history today. In the 1:45, number 3, Spectrometer, and number 15, Birdadon, on non-runners. And when we come off air, in the 4:35, number 10, Mercato, and 11, Jasmine Guichoir, on non-runners. In the 5:10, number 7, Tyne for Intersky, and 18, Golden Odyssey, also not running. You can email us today, let us know who you think is going to win the Grand National, or if you've got any questions for the team, if you want to know who they think will win the Grand National, on bbc.co.uk/racing, or text us on 81111.
Well, millions of people will be placing a bet on the Grand National today. For many of you at home, it may be your one and only trip down to the bookies. In case you haven't made up your mind just yet, let's take a look at the runners and riders in betting order. Favourite is Durasson, ridden by Tony McCoy, going for his first national win. Joss Naylor is 11-1 with Paul Carberry on board, the winning jockey back in 99. David's Lad went off favourite a couple of years ago, is 12-1. And Bindery, the winner 2 years ago, also 12-1. Well, a very consistent Hedge Hunter, also 12-1, along with Clan Royal, twice a winner here at Aintree. Bear on board 14-1 and Amberleigh House 16-1. What a fairy tale story that would be for Ginger McCain, of course, who trained Red Rum. Tom Scudamore has the ride on Chardam at 18-1. Monty's Pass going for the double, but last year's winner, carrying a lot more weight this year, is 20-1. What's Up Boys, second 2 years ago, 28-1. Gunnar Welburn, fourth last year, 28-1. The top weight, Le Coudre, 33-1, along with Takagi. Arctic Jack, trained by Sue Smith, ridden by Dominic Ellsworth, is 40-1. And King's Mark, fourth 2 years ago, 50-1, Mick Fitzgerald, another former winning jockey on board. And just in debt is Jim Colotti, another winning jockey. Exit to Wave was to be ridden by Ruby Walsh, but now he's out. It's now taken by Bobby McNally, and a risk assessor, one of four for JP McManus. Arden Scout also 66-1, another from Sue Smith. Blowing Wind been so consistent in this race, third twice, eighth last year, 80-1. Smarty was second in 2001, 150-1 shot this time, and Sky Cab at 200-1, a first runner for Nick Gifford, the son of Josh. And there we go. Mantle's Prince there at 300-1. One of the owners is Emlyn Hughes, who's battling cancer. He's going to be here today at Aintree to watch his horse run.
Well, I knew there's a reason why I was a snooker player, and this is it, because it's absolutely horrendous at the moment. Blustery, rain's got to get in the ground if it keeps up, Angus.
Yeah, if it keeps up. I think the next half an hour are going to be absolutely crucial. And those that like the soft ground, they're going to be coming of interest. It's just eased off a little bit, John, but it doesn't look too good, does it?
Now, have they found a favourite yet?
Yeah, Durasson is favourite at the moment, but Joss Naylor will love this ground. And if it continues, I think he's certain to start favourites later on. Here's the current prices. Durasson, 10-1 favourite. Joss Naylor, 11-1. That's as good as you'll get. 12-1 Clan Royal, Hedge Hunter, Bindery, David's Lad, and Bear on Board at 14, 16-1 bar. but horses like Acarus, the Wisdom Outsider, is going to well want to like this ground as well.
And what's the forecaster put up today, Angus?
Well, the forecaster, remember we put all the ingredients in that you would look at. There's that's the short list. Form, jockey, trainer, going, distance and course. They're the ones that they like. Now, which one comes out best? Clan Royal comes out best on the forecaster. Bear on board with the jockey. You can see that we've got the trainer, the going, the distance and the course. Durinson coming well into it. The going, of course, that could change. So a lot could happen there with the distance. Now, that's the thing that might put me off Clan Royal. Will it get the trip? Here's the course, but there, a massive positive for Clan Royal. And that's the forecaster selection. Bear on board for second. Binderee, former winner, in third. And Durinson for Tony McCoy, fourth. Now, that's very interesting, because he's been fourth twice, hasn't he, on Blowing Wind?
He certainly has. Now, it'd be remiss of me not to mention last year's winner, Monty's Pass. Got a big task, £20 extra to carry this year. But what price is he in the market?
Well, he's around 20, 22 to 1, but he wouldn't want any more rain. The ground last year was perfect. And it just depends what happens. We can't reiterate, John, how important the next hour is, really. If this Wayne gets into the ground, so many horses come into it and so many others go out of the equation. But Joss Naylor will love this, the bit of extra rain, and he will be challenging for favouritism very soon, I'm sure.
Okay, Angus, thanks very much, but don't rely on us for Monty's Pass well-being. We've now got connections on the line.
Absolutely, we do. We're talking about Monty's Pass, but I'm joined by the trainer, Jimmy Mangan, and talking about the rain there. I mean, I know you haven't wanted rain for the last few days. Is this a bit too late? Is this good for you or not?
I don't think it will make much of a difference at the minute. You know, that was a heavy shower. Hopefully it stops at that, but if it got any heavier, he wouldn't have any chance.
Oh, because I think the forecast is for more rain over the next hour, sadly.
Yeah. The sooner the races start for me now, the better.
What about his chances, though, carrying a lot more weight this time?
A lot more weight, but he's in terrific form. I couldn't ask to have him anything better than he is, you know. He had a great school around Tremorda recently, and we were very pleased with him. And he's 100%, and he's travelled over well, you know.
Yeah, and Barry obviously on board yet again, Barry Geraghty.
The top man on board. He's won the two big races here the past 2 days, and no better man to have, and he knows Monty.
Yeah, well, I remember when I was in the winner's enclosure, it was packed in there with owners and your family as well. A lot of members of your family here today?
Yeah, a lot more here this year, but maybe they're a year too late. Hopefully not, but a lot more this year. And, you know, he's a good, you know, he's going to give a big account of himself, and everybody's behind him, you know.
Well, we're just showing now some great memories for you. This is last year when Monty's Pass went home. Probably a sort of life-changing experience in a way. Look at that.
It was incredible. You know, the people down in Connor Village and from all over Munster and most parts of Ireland, they came to Connor that night to welcome him home, and it was incredible, and hasn't come back to normal since, really, you know.
Well, we've actually sent Brian Gleeson over to Connor. He's going to be with some of the fans looking at Monty's Pass, but he's also with a few members of your family, I believe. Watch this. This will be a surprise for you.
Well, Sue, you're in the winner's enclosure at Aintree, and I'm here in the winner's enclosure. It's a bar, a refreshment area in the town of Connor, about 45 minutes from Cork Airport, and it's the home of Monty's Pass, last year's winner. And the songs and the poetry have been written over the last 12 months, including the latest one to be scripted late last night. And here it is on the window of the winner's enclosure, and it reads, "The ancient legends once foretold of a warrior horse who shone like gold, with speed like wind across the grass, whisper it quietly, Monty's Pass." And here are Jimmy's family, Patrick Mangan, affectionately known as Paddy Mangan, named after his grandfather, a jockey of the future. He's ridden many, many pony races already, of course. Brian, yes, they're twins, and looking forward to the race. Brian, what do you think of Monty's Pass?
If he runs like he ran last year, he should have fairly good chances again. If the ground and he gets in the inside again like he got last year, there should be kind of, it's up to him then.
And there's a story aside from Monty's Pass, because he also bought Binderee as a youngster.
Yeah, we bought him as a foal, and he was out in the weed yard behind this pub here, and he was out in there until he was a 2-year-old, and then John, Mr. Costello came and he bought him off us, and he's Binderee now.
Best of luck, Brian. Jane, 10 years of age, but you're a real racing lady. Can Monty's Pass win again?
Well, everything went right for him last year. If it does again, he's got a pretty good chance, but the field is good this year. It's better than last year, I think.
Better than last year. We'll come back to Sumter Mangan later in the program, but great excitement. The big question is, can Monty's Pass win a second Grand National? Monty's Pass win a second Grand National.
So you see that they're going to enjoy all the excitement and the build-up there as well?
Yeah, the very same as if they're here, really. It's marvellous for them. I'm delighted.
OK, well, we will wish you well. All the best with Monty's Pass today, Jimmy.
Thank you awfully, sir. Thank you.
Well, Jimmy Mangan was making faces about this rain falling, though. So too is Tony McCoy. He's on board the horse that is currently favourite, Durançon, but he doesn't want this.
He doesn't want it to rain too much, Claire. His best form definitely last time at Haydock, and in the summertime at Etoxeter was on fast ground, so I want the rain to sort of go away quickly, hopefully.
I mean, apart from this, apart from the fact he doesn't like soft ground, and it may not rain enough to make it soft, he's got all the other credentials that marks him out as a really decent chance.
I think so, yeah. You know, the handicapper himself said that if he was doing the weights again, he'd give him a stone more, you know, so that's a big help in itself. There is one or two there if the rain kept going, like Josh Naylor obviously would love it, and he was the price wise horse this morning, so he's obviously well fancied. And but it's a Grand National, anyone can win, but hopefully Jurisson's got as good a chance as the rest of them.
And we heard you right at the start of this programme saying how much you enjoy the build-up to the National. So what have you been doing? What were you doing last night and this morning?
Unfortunately,
I didn't want to ask too personal a question, but you know.
Unfortunately, not a lot. I got 10-4 to do in the first, which is pretty much as late as it goes for me, and I've 10-7 in the Grand National, so very quiet. It was in the leisure centre in the hotel last night, with a swim and a sauna, and then just back to the racing today. The sauna again, so it was very quiet.
And I know that you're an Arsenal fan, you've been keeping half an eye on the footy, they're still 1-0 down, I'm afraid.
They're still 1-0 down, but they're playing well, you know. Just like to say, I don't know where Thierry's come on yet or not, but I'd like to see him appearing fairly soon. And they've got enough ability to get back into it and score again.
Okay, well, he has actually just come on, Thierry Henry. If Arsenal managed to pull it back and you managed to pull up a famous victory, that would be quite some double.
Be a nice day, yeah.
Absolutely. Good luck to you. Thank you. I'll let him go inside because it's getting pretty chilly as well out here, but conditions continuing to change. Umbrellas up all around us. It's a pretty filthy day, but safely dry and warm in the studio is Lydia, Peter Scudamore and Richard Pittman.
It's absolutely lovely and warm in here, Claire. Bad luck. This is where we're going to be doing all the race previews and analysing the races throughout the day for you, including the big one, the Grand National, and the tingling is starting already. With me to do just that, I've got Richard Pittman and Peter Scudamore as ever. Good afternoon.
That's why you're tingling, sitting next to two good-looking fellows.
No, it's the race.
Oh, is it? All right. Okay. Oh, it is fantastic, isn't it?
I'm really looking forward to it. We'll bring up some emails first of all. We've had one from Alan in Liverpool, who says, a nine-year-old or less will win the Grand National today. Of them, I've narrowed it down to two horses, either Hedge Hunter or Bear on board, but Jim Colletti is having the season of his life and maybe he'll win another National on Just in Debt. What's your idea of the winner?
I like What's Up Boys, and no grey horse has won it since Nicholas Silver, and then before in the 1980s, you know, the Lamb. But statistics are there to be broken. What's Up Boys, Hennessy winner, classy horse.
And your idea of the winner?
I think Binderee has an outstanding chance. He's made a mistake at Beaches three times the last four times he's jumped it. If he gets over it well and clean, he has an outstanding chance. He ran a fantastic race last year when Nigel's horses weren't as well as they are now, and he was sixth, and he's beaten Sir Rembrandt in the Welsh National, and that was brilliant.
Okay, well, I quite fancy Just in Debt each way. I think it'll run a big race. But I've been looking at the Grand National, and no race responds as well as the Grand National to applying statistics to it. So here are my golden rules for choosing a horse, if you haven't yet decided on which horse to bet on. First, number one, do not bet on any horse carrying 11 stone or more. No horse since Rhyme and Reason in 1988 has achieved that feat, and only two others in total since 1980, Corbière in 83 and Grittar in 82. Rule number two, do not bet on any horse carrying the minimum of 10 stone when their rating says they should ideally carry less. The form says that these horses should be carrying less than 10 stone to have a chance, but they can't because 10 stone is the minimum weight allowed. Only Bobby Joe in 1999 has managed to do this since 1985. From this field, that means eliminate number 20, Bramble Hill Duke, number 37, Wendell Weasel, number 38, Smarty, number 39, Montreal, and number 40, Luskadoo. Rule number three, do not bet on any horse that has yet to win over at least 3 miles. They always used to say, and some trainers still do, that 2.5 mile specialists win the National. They don't. Stayers do. Rule number four, for win purposes, do not bet on any horse that has run in the race before. It is a myth universally spoken that horses that have previously run in the race have an advantage. For win purposes, that is, course specialists regularly hit the places, but I wouldn't put you off them for that reason. And rule number five, this age group has won Your selection should be aged between 9 and 11. This age group has won between 17 of the last 23 runnings. That leaves you with a short list of these five. Takagi, you can knock him out because he's being visored for the first time, and only one horse from 118 in the last 28 years has won. That was Earth Summit in 98. Number 16, Joss Naylor. He hasn't run since the 29th of November, and most winners are battle-hardened. And the last 19 winners have all had a run within 6 weeks. Cross out 19 time and time again. He has headgear. He's wearing cheek pieces. He's also a novice. That means he can't win the national in my book. And number 27, Clan Royal, also falls foul of the previous run rule. Not raced since winning the Beecher Chase on the 29th of November. And also no winner of the Beecher Chase has ever subsequently won the Grand National or even participant of the Beecher Chase. He also won the Topham last year, and no winner of the Topham has won the Grand National. That leaves you with Bear on Board. 14 to 1. So that's 40 runners all down to 1. Easy.
Well, we are all here later today to crown new racing heroes after the Grand National's run, but we've also got a chance to reflect on those heroes past who grace the hallowed turf here at Aintree. It's time now for the Parade of Champions. Here's Richard Pittman.
And let's start with the biggest horse ever to win the Grand National. Do you know he stands at 18-1 hands high? That is huge. He's being led by a big lad, so it really makes him look a bit smaller. But he won, of course, in 1992, and what an apt race to win it. It was election year. Well, when he came home under Carl Llewellyn, the horse who had a tube in his throat to enable him to breathe came home for Nick Gaisley, who is to retire this year. Andy Andrews broke his leg on his shortened fall. Here's Minnie Homer. He'd be the smallest for years to have won. He won in 1994 for Martin Pike. He'd finished fifth in the Gold Cup and only carried 10 stone 4. He's beating Just So here. Freddie Starr, the comedian, owned the horse. He wasn't present, but he had a little touch on him. Don Woody, second winner there. And Rough Quest, the late Terry Casey, trained this one to win in 1996. Nick Fitzgerald rode him to win. And here you can just see him crossing on Coron Pur. And this was the only Stewards Inquiry in the National's history. Let's hope there isn't another one today. Lord Gilleen, well, no one will ever forget this one because he won for Sir Stanley Clark. On the Monday, we all just shivered for a couple of days and then saw the New Zealander come home. Tony Dobbin was in the saddle. He's 16 now. Lord Gilleen, and he's not the first New Zealander to win it. Now, Earth Summit, digger to everyone. And Earth Summit won in really contested conditions that tested it. And when he did come home, he beat Sunny Bay. Look how laborious it was. Peter Scudamore is part trainer, I'm sure, stop breathing in the commentary position here. Nigel Payne is owner. Well, he lost much needed weight. And for Carl Llewellyn, of course, his second victory. Papillon. Now, Papillon in 2000 was the gamble of the morning. Everybody lumped on him. The whole of Ireland was on. And when he won, of course, for Ruby Walsh and his father Ted, it was just one of those dreams. Now, in this win here, you can see he put his head down, and that was something he wasn't renowned for doing. He was thought to save a little bit for himself, but he was terribly genuine around these big fences for Betty Moran. Red Marauder, of course, the latest of the winners. He's only recently been retired. He won in 2001, and what a race that was. The conditions were the most testing we've seen, and only two finished on their own volition. Two more remounted to finish. Papillon and Blowing Wind, of course. Smarty was second on this occasion. Richard Guest, who really loved him and trained him. I just must give you a note here on the oldest winner. 20 years ago he won, and of course that's Hello Dandy. He's 30 years of age now, and he's having a holiday. Didn't want to travel here because of the strain. But they're the champions. Who will join them this year?
Was it wonderful to see those great heroes from the past, and Richard Pittman, of course. But whose name will be added to the champion's roll of honour this time? Well, John Joe O'Neill will certainly be hoping it's one of his two runners today. He didn't have a great record in the race. In fact, he never got round, but he still loves this day and loves this race. And he's hoping that one of his horses, and two of them are the favourites, Clan Royal or Josh Naylor, can come home first. Richard Pittman travelled to the yard to check on the final preparations.
We'll be right back.
any horse could choose where he would like to be trained, then surely Jackdaw's Castle in Gloucestershire comes pretty close to equine heaven. The idyllic setting certainly delivers results for trainer John Joe O'Neill. He had three winners at this year's Cheltenham Festival. Leading the way was 50-1 shot, Creon. Then Native Emperor captured the four-miler. And Iris's Gift, the star.
Iris's Gift sticking up brilliantly! Iris's Gift still leads! Barracuda's going to be beaten! And it's Iris's Gift!
Iris's Gift then, the champion stayer. But the whole week brought great satisfaction.
If you get one winner, you're happy at Cheltenham because it's a tough old place to get winners, but we've been very lucky.
But Iris's Gift must have really raised your spirits, because to beat Barracuda, who looked a certainty, it was only his second run of the season.
He's an amazing horse, really. He's really tough and genuine, and he seems to be jumping really well. I suppose he's getting a bit stronger now on that. Great race, race at the meeting, obviously, because you're involved in it, but, you know, the two really top-class horses, and it's just lovely to see him.
But has John Joe got any more irons in the fire for the Grand National? Which of his two horses will prove to be the Aintree iron? Leading the way is Clan Royal, twice the winner over the big fences for jockey Liam Cooper.
He's brilliant down there. He literally just hurdles the national fences. And when he's quick like that over them, it's a big plus.
150 yards left to go though. Clan Royal being punched right out here by Liam Cooper. He's about two or three in front.
You've known where you were going for the National for a long time, because this has been the horse's aim, hasn't it?
Oh, definitely. Ever since he won his Topham chase there this time last year, and then we ran him in the Beecher chase just to see if he gets that bit further. And the way he came up the hill at Aintree in the Beecher chase, it's something to look forward to.
Amberleigh House in front, but Clan Royal is fighting back. Clan Royal and Amberleigh House stride for stride. There's nothing in it. Nip and tuck in the run of the line.
He's a very big horse, a very tall horse, Mr. Endington, and he's a great way of operating, you know. But he's very keen, you know, he has to be up there. He takes a fair old tug.
Like that, because you love your mum. Don't you?
Have there been any other good horses out of box 13?
While I've been here, I've only ever had him and Ballylusky in box 13.
So this is the man in your life then, is it?
Oh yeah, the only man in my life. You can't put that on, by the way.
Oh, I don't know, that's good stuff. John Joe's other big race hope is Joss Naylor. Second in the Hennessy Gold Cup, he has obvious credentials for national glory.
He loves soft ground, touch wood, he's a very accurate jumper normally, has a bit of class, and I think will suit the place pretty well, really. He's got a good jockey in him, Paul Carberry. Hasn't ridden him before, but don't think that'll make any difference to Paul. Like him a lot.
Just thinking about Aintree and your record there, never getting round, does it bug you now?
No, it doesn't really. I mean, I'd love to go around. We still look forward to National every year. You know, that's the magic about it, really, isn't it? You know, you have to have so much luck in running and so on and so forth, and you've got to have the best horse to operate around there, and then you've got to have the fastest horse to get around. So it's a magic race, really. It's different to everything else, and it's a magical day.
I think the message is magic. He's really looking forward to it, John Joe O'Neill. Never got round it as a jockey, but with me two men who have. Tom Scudamore, one of the youngest jockeys in the race, he's on board Shardam, and Carl Llewellyn, who's won it twice and is on board a former winner in Bindaree. And Tom, you got round for the first time last year on Blowing Wind. What did you learn from that, do you think?
Lots of things, obviously, how big the fences were, and obviously it was a great experience last year. And, you know, it's just something we can build on and hopefully go a bit better this year.
And as for you, Carl, you had a horrible fall yesterday at Beeches, and we were a bit worried about whether you were going to be fit to ride.
Yeah, I had a few kicks, but passed the doctor this morning, had a bit of physio, and I'm okay now.
You were feeling your shoulder when you were down there on the ground. I guess you're just checking every bit of you to see if you're right.
I feel everywhere, just in case.
Well, not quite everywhere, possibly. We can have another look at it, actually. I'm not sure you want to see this, but so many horses came down, and the real worry is, when are you going to get kicked by another one?
Yeah, there was horses everywhere and jockeys everywhere, but
that's
I did get
a pee on the ground. Then.
I did get a few kicks, but nothing too bad. So.
You see, but you're older than the rest, so you take a bit longer to get up, don't you?
Yeah, there's no point. You have to wait for the ambulance, otherwise they drive by.
Well, to get a lift back.
That's
home.
Right, yeah.
But it is amazing looking at those shots. I mean, full credit to you guys and how brave you are, and being able to bounce back from that, you know.
Well, it's good fun, isn't it? It's better than a real job.
Now, what about Bindery this year? You've fancied him for a long time. You decided to ride him way back at Christmas. He won the Welsh National. He looks actually in really good form this year.
Yeah, that's as good a run as he's ever had, really, the Welsh National. And, you know, in hindsight, he'd beaten Sir Ambran that day, with him finishing second to best mate in the Gold Cup. If you take it literally, then it's great form. And you say he's well in. I'm glad to see a bit of rain, make it more of a stamina test, you know, otherwise it's gonna suit a few of the others more than me.
Now, most people know that Carl decided not to ride Bindery the year that he won, but I didn't realise until today, Tom, that you'd been offered the ride on Bindery and turned it down.
Yeah, no, that was obviously something you live to regret.
Just a bit.
There we go, you know, decided to ride Smarty. There we go, never mind. It was all in the past now.
So how was the choice made this year? Did you leave it up to Carl to make the decision and you say, I'll take your leftover?
Something like that.
And the worrying thing now is, I mean, Carl, people will have seen you in the preview programme last year, and you must be worried slightly that Chardin's got just as good a chance as Bindery.
Well, it's nice to have a choice of two good horses. You know, a lot of people ride in this race, and they've got absolutely no chance of winning. So I'd prefer to have a choice of two good ones with a realistic chance, but I've no chance in going around there for the fun of it. At least I've got a great chance of winning.
Absolutely. Well, hope both of you get round safely, and maybe we'll see you in those closing stages. Good luck.
Take it.
Well, everyone has a different reason for picking their horse in the National. You might pick a jockey you like Carl or Tom. You might just get a pin out or pick a name you like. You might even study the form. But there's some lovely names in the National this year. Something like Smarty or Wonder Weasel might appeal. Just in Debt, well, I hope that's not appropriate for you. In Blowing Wind might be your choice, who knows. But if you love cuddly teddy bears, then the name you might go for is Bear on Board. That's trained by Alan King, and Jim McGrath has that story.
Alan King trains at Barbary Castle near Rawton, a town steeped in Grand National history. Today, Bear on Board tries to uphold that tradition.
So, Alan, that's the last bit of work. Is that him now for the National?
More or less. I mean, he'll take over, you know, the couple of canters tomorrow and Friday, and we'll probably box him up on Saturday morning.
He's a horse who seems to have improved so much this year. Has it been a real surprise to you?
Totally. I mean, I think we started the season 113, and I sort of said to the owners, you know, I think we might win a little handicap somewhere. And it wasn't really until Cheltenham on New Year's Day that somebody thought he might be a national horse. He was very impressive that day and beat a good field.
Well, that was 4 miles that day, and if you look at the stats, I think a horse called Seagram won that race and then went on and won the National.
Right.
So does that give you a bit of heart?
Yeah, of course it gives you a bit of heart. You know, the old boy seems in good form. But my gut feeling all the way through was he probably didn't have enough class for a national, but, you know, he stays. He's touch wood, he's jumped very well this year. We'll give it a go.
Let's look at the Haydock run, where he finished second behind Durancon. What did you make of that performance?
I was very happy with it. I mean, the one thing I wanted to do desperately was to get a prep run into him. I mean, he hadn't run since New Year. We'd given him a break. The ground would have been as fast as he wants it that day. And I think we got the track record by quite some way. The first two went clear, and he had to make all his ground on the last circuit on his own, and that's not an ideal sort of situation for him. He's a horse that loves to be carried along with other horses, so I was very happy with him.
Surely the Grand National is going to be ideal for him.
It should be, you know, a big field, and you know, as long as he takes to it. I mean, I haven't schooled him over any sort of similar fences, but I mean, he's been round Haydock twice and Cheltenham this year, so yeah, I mean, he looks to have all the attributes, but you know, we'll see.
Now, what sort of preparation would you have to give a horse getting him ready for the Grand National?
I don't know. I mean, I probably haven't done anything different with this race than I would any other. He did his last series gallop last Saturday. I mean, we walked a mile up the main grass gallop, the Barbary Mile, and a decent lead horse by his standards, and, you know, we stretched him. You know, they've got to be fit.
How would you describe Bear on Board's attitude to work at home?
He's probably worked better this season than he ever had, but he is fairly lazy. He usually just does enough, but he's probably done better work this season than he ever did before.
Alan King is one of racing's younger breed, and he's had an excellent grounding in the game.
I think in 1985 I moved down south to join David Nicholson. I think supposedly for about 6 months, but we ended up staying 15 years. You know. We got on very well and still do. I mean, there's very few days that we don't speak. And
it's always great for a bit of advice if I'm struggling with something, you know. The quality of the yard's going up. You know, we've been out here now 4 years, and we've just hopefully been upgrading the whole time, and I'm delighted the way it's going. And I've got a wonderful staff and a very good stable jockey, and it's all so important. I mean, it's not a one-man show by any means.
And it is a real battle for a trainer to establish himself, isn't it?
It is. I mean, I was very fortunate that I took over from the Duke when he retired. So I was very lucky when I started, and I had a lot of decent old horses to take over. But the most important thing is to have the ammunition, and I'm lucky I've got that, and I've got owners that will spend a lot of money as well. So it makes it a bit easier for me than some people.
Is it important, the National, to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's one race you certainly don't want to expect too much, because you know what can happen. I mean, we could fall across in the Melling Road or something, you know. So. If things go well, he's got a great chance, but equally he could get brought down at the first or follow up the first or something, so we'll just have to see what happens.
Well, joining me now is a 19-year-old James Davis, who's riding in his first national this year, along with his father, Hugh Davis, who won the national back in 1985. So first of all, James, how are the nerves feeling at the moment?
I'm pretty calm at the moment, but I'm sure as it builds up, you know, we get a bit more wound up. And
And Bramble Hill Duke came in yesterday, so you haven't had a long time to sort of really prepare for it.
That's right. No, it's fairly lucky. A couple of horses came out, and luckily he got in for me, so...
Okay. What advice would you give, Dad?
Well, I spoke to Norman Williamson, you're one of your partners here. He's ridden the horse before, so I asked, the first person I asked was Norman to see what he thought, and he gave us a good bit of advice, so hopefully that'll stand him in good stead.
Because, of course, we're taking you back to 1985 when you won on Last Suspect. I think we can show you that now, because you beat some very good horses, didn't you?
Yeah, Mr. Snugfield was quite a good horse, and I think Mr. Ramsden had something involved in with the horse.
All the air and grease paint also.
That's right, and grease paint, yes, certainly very, very good horses. And he was a very good horse in his own right, though. I don't think it was all down to jockey, it was down to the horse more than anything else. He was a very good horse, and he turned into a bit of a monkey in his time, but he supplied that day.
And what difference did that make to you as a winning jockey in the National?
It's a great kick for a jockey, and all the professionals will say that as the years go by, the race becomes more important. You win all the other races you win as well are equally as important, but that one seems to linger with you a lot longer after you've retired.
I'm sure the race is difficult, but what about the build-up? Because that's something different for James to look forward to today.
It's certainly more worrying for his father, I think, because he seems pretty cool, and we'll see how he is on the way home.
Because you've jumped over the fences, haven't you? Because you've jumped in the top one before.
That's right. I've been lucky enough to have two spins round here. One on Cassia Heights, who won yesterday, and one for their boss, Brendan Powell, Eau de Cologne. So
what advice have you been given? Because going to that first fence just always seems to catch a few out. What advice have you been given?
That's right. Well, the boss, Brendan Powell, said just don't go too long at the first. And Dad said more or less the same. And hopefully we'll get over the first three and take it from there.
Where are you going to nervously watch from then?
I'm doing some work with the Welsh radio. So I'm bilingual, so I do the Welsh radio. And I'm supposed to be looking at all the horses, but I think I'll be concentrating on one.
Okay, well, we wish you well and good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, here with a couple of interested celebrities up in their lovely warm surroundings while I've been getting soaked by the betting ring. We've got Darren Jordan and Alice Beer. Welcome to Aintree. First time here, Darren.
First time here. And what a great course. This is my first time here at Aintree and my first time at the Grand National. And it's an absolutely fantastic atmosphere. Thousands of people. And it really is an exciting place to be on a day like today.
Now, are you a form man, or did you just put it in with a pin? Did you stick it in with a pin?
Well, you know, just a bit of both. In fact, Alice's husband is the form man, and he gave me a few tips. I've gone for Bunny Boiler, because what a great name, a scary name for a horse.
His wife told him to do that based on his ex-girlfriend, if the truth be.
Aha, maybe, just slightly. But also, I went for Risk Assessor, which at 100 to 1, 10 quid. If I walk away with £1,000 today, I'm happy with that.
Do you think you would be? And Alice, you've completely ignored all your husband's advice.
I have done. I've spent 4 hours on the train up here studying the form, the going, and the jockey's mother-in-law. And then I decided just not to put my eggs in one basket. Spread your bets, and I've got about five different nags for the one race. But one of them is going to romp home. And my betting, from inside knowledge, I don't know what this means, accurate.
Actually, well, I haven't gone for Bunny Boiler.
No. Well, if none of those win, we're all going back to work.
Well, our opening race on the card is about to happen. The horses are making their way out onto the course. It's the Martel Cordon Bleu handicap hurdle. It's a listed race worth a good deal. deal of money as well. Total prize fund of 45,000, 19,571 to the winner. It was won last year by the 20-1 shot Risky Reef. 2 years ago by Intersky Falcon, who runs later this afternoon. Alan Shearer is in the syndicate that owns him, and Docklands Limo won it in 2001. 9 hurdles to be jumped, 2 miles, 110 yards, and there's 2 non-runners. Jim McGrath can take us through the field that do go.
Yes, let's have a look at this first race. Runners at the post now. Let's check them very quickly. 2 non-runners, Spectrometer and also Bernadon. Number 1 is Limerick Boy, replacement rider here, Tony Dobbin, replacing Sam Thomas, who's not riding. In contrast is Richard Johnson, Spectrometer out. Barry Geraghty is Man of Mystery. Demi Bow is Noel Feely. Jaboon Warren Marston. Mick Fitzgerald rides Green Hope. Tom Greenall rides Noel House. Tony McCoy, Idaho Docks. Mark Walsh is aboard Puckout. Roddy Green on Desert Air. Red Sun is Lee Vickers. Anno Jubilo is David Casey. Fundamental, Liam Cooper. Taking out Bernadon, King Solomon, Richie McGrath. And then Italian Council, Derek Laverty. Another dude, Graham Lee. Stephen Crane's on Sciardi. Porton Faller is Paul Carbery. And Jack Dawson, Jim Cullity. They're the 19 runners, and let's have a look at the betting now on this opener.
A very competitive race, a big gamble going on one of the outsiders. Portent Fella, that's come into 14s. I've seen 33 that this morning. King Solomon is 8-1, second favourite. Fundamental is the 4-1 favourite. The each-way horse is Portent Fella.
Now 19 horses at the start for our first race. And Skew, how do you think this race is actually going to be run?
Yeah, I think it's going to be a pretty fast race. Fundamental will race up there. His form's very, very good. Limerick Boys won round this course, and Idaho Docks was second to Intersky Falcon round here. Those are probably the best of the English horses. Green Hope comes in with a bit of a chance. The Irish horses, you never know what the handicap mark of those is against the English horses, so okay, they could be the ones there to upset that theory.
But you know, the front runners, Green Hope also is a front runner. That will help the okay gamble, Porton Fellow. Jonah Morgansmile, that likes to come from behind. Late challenge. There's Limerick Boy in front.
Jim just wants to keep an eye on Man of Mystery. He can be sometimes slow out of the gate. He's a horse with undoubted ability. That's for him, the black colours at the back there, but he can be a little bit quirky about his racing.
Do you know, it's worth mentioning here that the favourite Fundamental is actually a half-brother to Intersky Falcon, who runs later on in the day. You know, some of these good old jumping mares keep producing good horses.
And that horse is very, very showing very, very progressive form, improving very, very quickly. Horse I like is number 6, Jaboon from the Alan King Yard, who of course fielding there on board in the National later.
Yeah, but he's been chasing, you know, and he's slightly gone off the boil a little bit. Perhaps he'd be happy coming back to hurdles.
Well, that was my theory. I thought that he'd brighten up for a switch back to the smaller obstacles.
We shall very soon find out. The rain, not too bad. I won't have changed it particularly. 17, there is Italian Council, Luke Dace's horse, this one. They set up a sequence. I wonder if they're just looking to see if he's okay, Skew.
Yeah, they're looking to see if he got kicked. There's another horse kicking there, so they just want to be careful. Jim, it doesn't look as it's long before they take off, and I hope nothing else gets kicked.
Certainly hope not, Skew. They're coming out onto the course, and the crowd in anticipation of this first race on Martel Cognac Grand National Day 2004. The 19 runners coming into line, and they're racing. And a big roar from the crowd as they're often racing in our opener, and the leader down near the inside is Fundamental, who goes on here from Idaho Docks, and out wider on the track is Green Hope in the early stages. Another dude is up there as well. Just in behind them is Demi Bow, tucked away with a red jacket on the inside. Further back in the center is Desert Air with those big red blinkers, and on the inside Limerick Boy as they come into the straight the first time. Further back in the field is Anno Jubilo. They're followed next by In Contrast as they come to the first of 9 flights, and they all get over it safely. Back in the field on settling, we see Porton Fella, and over on the far side, Jaboon at the second, and Fundamental led over it here from another dude on settling. Green Hope is up running third, followed by Demi Bow and Idaho Docks, and out deeper on the track is Desert Air. In behind them is Red Sun as they come to the third, followed by Anno Jubilo. Further back, Man of Mystery went right down on his nose there, and a magnificent recovery by Barry Geraghty, but he's lost all chance, Man of Mystery, by that blunder. As we come up to the judge with a circuit to go, and Fundamental is the leader by 3 lengths to Green Hope, and then in third is is another dude. Followed there, it's been pulled up by Man of Mystery. Back in fourth now, the inside is Demi Bow as they swing out of the home straight now with just under a circuit to go. Further back in the field, Red Sun travelling on the inside here of Desert Air, and further back then on the outside is Anno Jubilo. They're followed next by Limerick Boy getting through along the inside of Idaho Docks. Porton Fella is wider out, followed by King Solomon, and back in the field, Jack Dawson. They're followed by Jaboon, and in contrast and way out the back is Shayadi as they clear the first one down the back. Puck out as well back there as well, so too is Italian Council, and they've drawn away now from Noel House. Heading now towards the fifth, and the leader striding on here as it's a fundamental, the far side, a good shot of him there as they come towards the fifth. He's wide off the track, leads by a couple of lengths here to Greenhope, who cleared it in second. Another dude is up there in third. In behind them is Limerick Boy as they continue their journey down the back. Out wider on the track there is Anno, at this stage is Anno Jubilo, as they come to the last one down the back there. And a big horse, one down there, there's one or two down. In fact, there's it's a real tumble, this one. There's two or three down. Idaho Docks was badly hampered there, and also coming down was King Solomon. That was a bad fall as they leave the back, and it's fundamental, the leader, by two or three lengths. Two on the inside, Green Hope. Up on the outside at this stage is Anno Jubilo. In behind them, Demi Bow, followed next in the field by Limerick Boy, and Puck Out coming into it from Shayadi. Further back is In Contrast and Jack Dawson around the outside. They've kicked away from Noel House, who's made a few places. Jaboon is right out the back as they swing the corner, and another dude is being pulled up. Fundamental, though, is the leader by four lengths as they straighten. From in second, Green Hope, battling on as Demi Bow. Puck Out is running on well as at the third last now. Fundamental cleared it well, lands over at three lengths clear. Puck Out is the big danger on the near side. Green Hope is flat to the boards, followed by Demi Bow. Coming to the second last, Fundamental grabbed now by Puck Out on the near side. Green Hope is behind them, followed then by Demi Bow and Jack Dawson down the outside. They've got one flight left to jump. It's Puck Out, the leader, on the near side. Demi Bow coming at him at the last. Puck Out, Demi Bow's a faller. This leaves Puck Out two in front of Fundamental, then Green Hope. This might be a winning advantage. It's Puck Out in the JP McManus colours on Grand National Day by four or five lengths, and starting to power away here. It's Puck Out who's going to go on and win it well. Wins the opener on National Day by four or five lengths. Fundamental is second. Jack Dawson gets third, followed by Green Hope, and behind them is In Contrast. Further back in the field is Jaboon. They're followed then by Limerick Boy, and back behind them is Desert Air. They're followed by Shayadi, who finishes next ahead of Noel House. Well back is Anno Jubilo, and Italian Council is the last to finish. Another dude in Idaho Docks were both pulled up. And the fallers over on the far side, one of them was number 12, Red Sun. King Solomon was another one who came to grief there. But, and there's Demi Bow, who went down at the last. He's up on his feet, and I'm pleased to say that Noel Feely is also. But the famous JP McManus colours have been carried to victory in the first race by Mark Walsh, a £7 claimer on number 10, Puck Out, trained by Christy Roach. Second is number 14, Fundamental, owned by Dean Green, trained by John Joe O'Neill, ridden by Leah Cooper. 10-1 the winner. Third, number 21, Jack Dawson, owned by the Premier Crew, trained by John Berry and ridden by Jim Cullity. And fourth, Green Hope. That's the 1, 2, 3, 4, and there are those colours. He's got four runners in the National, JP McManus.
We'd seen this horse previously at Ascot when it was a lot muddier than today, but looking at those colours, it is quite muddy. The running, as we'd expected, had been by Fundamental, who has run his heart out.
He has. He's really tried hard under Liam Cooper, who's normally more known for his hold-up rides, but he gave this one a good front running ride. All four of them in a line here, and the one in the red colours that falls at the last is Demi Bow, still there, two out, but beginning to be under pressure. And at this point, Mark Walsh, with a very mature ride, has taken it up.
Yeah, I mean, to me, the thing of the race here is obviously the fallers is Fundamental hanging right. There's Demi Bow falling. I think he'd probably been second. I think the winner's was the best horse in the race anyway, but Fundamental didn't look that keen going out down the back first time.
Liam Cooper's had to give him a few smacks, and you can see him, he's leaning over to the towards the right there, and as Lydia says, it's a very good ride from a young man. I don't know much about Mark Walsh, but he looks a man that we're going to see a lot of, because he's a very talented young rider.
He claims a 7 skew, but the horse would have won with another £7. You know, he's won quite easily. And Jack Walsh, there's JP. It looks like being out enjoying himself last night with a plaster over one eye.
I think he had some, I think he was bitten, I think that's what it is, that's the reason more likely to be. Anyway, is it, Jim, an omen for the big one?
Well, who knows, it might be, Lydia, because JP McManus, those famous colours, the green and yellow with a white cap, he's got Le Coudre, he's got Miss Accessor, there's those prices, 10 to 1 the winner, 4's Fundamental, 25 Jack Dawson and 11's Green Hope. Going back to JP though, he's got Le Coudre, Risk Accessor, also Clan Royal and Spot the Difference. With this bit of rain we had here, there were people rushing around after Clan Royal, but it's going to be very interesting to see if we do get any more rain. It was a real sharp burst of rain for about 20 minutes and it was very, very solid. Well, there's young Mark Walsh, and JP's down at the interview stand now with Claire.
He is. He's just waiting for Puckout to come into the winner's enclosure. JP, congratulations. That's a nice start
today. Thank you very much. Great start. You know, great for Mark. His first ride round Liverpool, and I think it's his last ride claiming 7. So it's exciting.
Well, start to a big day for you, because you've got 4 runners in the National as well.
Yeah, well, we're hopeful, you know, but it's nice to get one anyway, and hopefully we'll bring off the double now, but we'll celebrate this one anyway.
Well, now, you're a very, very good judge, and you know I have a soft spot for Clan Royal, but you've backed Le Coudre each way, haven't you?
I did a little bit on Le Coudre. I thought he was the class horse in the race. I know he's 11-12 to hump round. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if he runs a big race, and Christie's shown that he's informed, so who knows, you know.
Okay, well, I've one more thing to tell you. Manchester United are through to the final of the FA Cup. They've just beaten Arsenal 1-0.
So I believe, yeah. Well done to them.
Good stuff, Bill. That'll keep him smiling. Thanks, JP. Thanks. Let you go and congratulate Mark. And the reason, obviously, for mentioning that is that JP is a major shareholder in Manchester United. He's won the first year at Aintree. Let's check the SPs.
And he'd be pleased with the SP here, Puckout, at 10-1, beating second number 14, Fundamental, the 4-1 favourite. Third number 21, Jack Dawson, at 25-1. And fourth number 7, Green Hope, at 11-1, 19 round.
Oh, joining me now is Andrew Balding and Gunnar Welburn. I mean, it was a fantastic race last year, fourth, and almost looked like he was going to win it a little way out.
Yeah, we were getting quite excited for a moment, but he's got stamina limitations, which we sort of knew before last year, and the petrol did run out. But I'm just hoping with this a little bit of rain might slow the tempo of the race down and give us a bit more chance.
Oh, that's good for you then, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we hopefully get a bit more.
Well, so what are the chances, though, realistically for you this year?
Well, what he's got in his favour is that he's in great form, and he's got experience of entry. He's run 3 great races here in the past, so it's got to be a bonus. But the negatives are the big stamina questions.
Mm. Okay, well, it would be lovely to see you in this winner's enclosure. Of course, we saw you at Epsom winning the Oaks, which was a fantastic day. I mean, Claire lost it, your sister lost it, your dad lost it. You were the only one who could speak that day.
Yeah, I don't know whether if we won a national, I don't think I'd be able to speak, but it's a dream. I mean, there are 39 other people with the same dream, so we'll give it our best shot and hope for the best.
Because the National does mean a lot to you. I mean, Claire's been talking about what it meant to you when you were growing up.
Yeah, it's played a big part in our lives. I mean, we've got sort of family history with the race going back for generations, really. And it would be very special. And more recently, of course, my uncle Toby's won it a couple of times. And Dad never managed it, and he had the one runner, but he loves the race. And we would dearly, dearly love to have a winner one day.
Hope it's today. Hope to see you in there later on. Good luck. Thanks very much, Andrew. Well, first race done, a win for Ireland. I wonder how that went down in Connor. Brian Gleeson is there.
Very well, Sue. There was lots of people backed Puckout at 10-1, and it could be a big afternoon for Irish horses, of course. We have 10 runners in the big race. Yes, 25% of the field are trained in Ireland. Alexander Banquet, David's lad. Takagi is one, trained by Edward O'Grady, ridden by Davy Russell, and I'm joined by Davy's dad, Jerry Russell. Davy,
Jerry, it's a big afternoon for you. You must be very proud.
We are indeed, and it's a great day for David. He's a second-row international, and I hope that the horse will run well. I think he'll jump, and maybe at the end of the day he could be there or thereabouts, and I think he's worth a few bob each way.
Well done, Jerry. Best of luck to you. And Assumpta Mangan, sister-in-law of Monty's Pass. There are lots of people in Connor very superstitious.
They are indeed, including my own husband, who declined the offer to come with me today. He's staying in Rathbarry to look at the race in peace and tranquility, and I think Monty should do it.
That's Assumpta Mangan here at Connor, and Jerry Russell, father of Davy Russell. There's growing confidence that there can be an Irish-trained winner of the National.
Well, there'll certainly be huge celebrations in Connor in Ireland if the winner of the big one is from there. Of course, Monty's Pass going for the double there. But here at Aintree, well, we're just enjoying the build-up to the big race. Of course, the Martel Cognac Grand National gets underway at 3:45. 4.5 miles around this gruelling course. 30 fences they must clear, including some of the most famous, Beecher's Brook, the Canal Turn, and, of course, the Chair and the Water Jump in front of the grandstand. But you can see it is absolutely packed here. 70,000 people expected here today to enjoy this wonderful spectacle. It's more than just a sporting event, it is a very special occasion. So we are now coming to the end of our coverage here on BBC2. We'll be switching over to BBC1, so do make sure you join us there for one of the great days of sport. So that is it for now on BBC Two. So much to look forward to. We'll introduce you to so many of the main contenders. News on Paul Carberry, a cut lip, but he expects to be on one of the favourites, Joss Naylor, for the big race. We'll see you over on...
It was just something to behold. Lou Barker at Aintree for the Grand National.
Thanks, Gary. Yes, welcome back to Aintree for one of the great days of sport, the running of the Martel Cognac Grand National. It's an event that attracts huge crowds here on the course and on television around the world. But whether you're lucky enough to be here at Aintree or watching in comfort at home, no doubt you will enjoy the excitement and drama of the world's greatest steeplechase.
It's one of the biggest sporting events in the world. It's something that every jockey wants to win, no matter who you are, no matter how many races you have won.
It's a fantasy with kids growing up.
Red Rum is going to win the National!
I think everybody that rides a horse dreams of maybe riding the National.
It is a magical race. It's absolutely unique. There is no other race in the world like it. It's part of this country.
What goes with the National is nothing that I've ever experienced before or after. It is massive.
I love the build-up to it.
The buzz when they come out of that weighing room.
I love the start of it.
You can hear the roar, the crowd.
It's great to be able to take part in it.
Words can't describe how you feel.
Some stage you're going to get it wrong, and the horse has to be able to get it right.
To get round and finish, that is an achievement.
Because you never know what can happen.
If I could say, I rode round Liverpool, that would be the peak of any horseman's career.
It's every jockey's dream doing the Grand National.
It's the greatest feeling you'll ever experience.
It is the most incredible sensation. You can see it on their faces, you can hear it in their voices. To win the Grand National is the ultimate peak of any jockey's career. But the best thing for you at home is that it is a race that you feel you can be part of. The names are familiar, of the horses, of the fences, of the people who are involved. And what about for the locals? It's obviously a big Liverpool occasion, and Keith Wilson, our resident poet, is also a Liverpool boy. So he can give us his alternative view on what the locals think of the race.
On the banks of the River Mersey, Liverpool. A library of heroic stories from the mean green grass of home. Stunning architecture, roughly hewn in classic pose. The irrepressible sense of humour.
You're having a laugh, aren't you?
You're joking.
Music that not only shook the nation, but the whole world. And the home of the Grand National. If you're born in the city, you're probably aware of the National's place in our heritage.
Do you think the National fits into that?
Oh, yes.
Racing.
Yes.
You couldn't take the Grand National anywhere else and it'd be the Grand National.
That's about upbringing, isn't it, the National, like.
But some people don't make the connection. I say Liverpool, you say...
Everton. England.
River.
Jersey.
Liverpool.
Cavan.
In fact, some people are unsure where Aintree is.
No, I didn't actually realise that Aintree was near Liverpool.
having a laugh, aren't you?
The fact of the matter is, well, it really couldn't be anywhere else.
You couldn't take the Grand National to any other course in the country, in my view, anyway. I mean, it's just unique.
Everything that makes Liverpool a city so bright in the firmament that the wearing of shades is almost obligatory is at the core of this meeting.
If you ask anybody about a horse race in England, there's only one race they'd mention. That's the Grand National.
Of course I'm biased. They can't touch you for it.
This is a lot of scouts at the inn, and to be back with your own folk, it's something I look forward to anyway.
The Grand National. Aintree. Liverpool.
Well, many people here to enjoy, of course, the big race here at Aintree, including Her Royal Highness, the Princess Royal, talking there to Ted Walsh, who, of course, had to pull Rinkeri out, sadly, from the race. But, of course, Ted Walsh, winner with Papillon back in 2000. And it's amazing who you do bump into here at Aintree. Johnny Vegas is here, and Scoo's made it down from the warmth of his commentary box. But we know you're a racing fan.
Well, yes, I've you know, from jockeying to betting to training to one day possibly owning, rather than gluing action men on cats and sending them round the back garden, I'm that step closer to bringing a real horse here. I can't tell you how excited I am.
I've got to say, we've got to take you back to last year when you attempted to become a jockey. You didn't quite make the weight, though, did you?
No, and you look at me in the same way so as everybody else did when I suggested it. You've got to have a dream. If you don't have a dream, how are you going to make a dream come true? The fact that the horse is scattered, it was hard enough to get one to sit on it. You know, I was up against it from the start, but I persevered. And only thanks to this man and his belief in me and him telling me to continue when everybody else wanted me to give up, the dream almost became a reality.
Go on, Johnny, talk us through this. What was going through your mind?
Well, here, obviously, it's all about inner thigh work. And, you know, horses are very sentimental things, so before you just go jumping on one willy-nilly, you've got to feel comfortable within you. They can sense your nerves. You know, like if you lean over on a date and kiss someone too quickly, without building... Now, here we go.
Phone ringing. Not now. You look a little nervous there, Johnny, I've got
it's
to say.
It's the jockey club. I've retired. Can you see how I just pull him up to a hole there, though? I don't toy with him. I gain his trust, but I gave that horse a belief that it never had before.
Scoo, how tough was it to train him?
It was one of the funniest 2 days of filming I've ever... I mean, he's an absolute genius in front of the camera without his riding, but he was very brave at times as well, because that wasn't meant to happen. Humphrey was meant to be stood still, and other people said, "No, leave him alone," and Humphrey sort of trotted off towards his stable, and I was screaming, "Catch him, catch him," because I thought one of our best comedians could be heading up the M50 on an old cart horse.
It was 10 seconds on the horse before, "Tell me you got that, tell me you got it." But you know, my mum didn't realise it was him with a jumper, with a pillow up his jumper. My mum was going, "I thought you were really good for your first time."
Johnny, have you got a message for the jockeys watching in the jockeys' room? Because I mean, you now know how tough it is, this job.
Yes, I do. I know you do a tough job, but the thing is, you won't always have that figure. So as much as you've got to think about your career, start developing a personality.
And do you have a tip for the race?
I do, bird on board.
But how have you fared so far?
I've backed two that have sort of dropped out the first race. One was tripped and one was, I don't know, Zola Budesque type. If you see me backing anything, stay away.
So why bear on board then?
Bear on board, because I just keep hearing such good things about it. And like a bear, like myself, who wants to one day be on the board. You know, there's a bit of an end in there, but he's done good. He's got some good form to show. And I think today, God should give me something for what he's done to me. I had a dream about this bird on a board, and he was talking to me. It was very Twin Peaks. And you were there, Skill.
Don't worry.
In a rah-rah skirt. Then my alarm went off. It could have got ever so interesting.
Well, we'll see if your dream comes true later. We'll maybe speak to you if you have a winner.
If you see you walking around in a skirt, you'll know I'm counting my money.
Okay, Johnny Scoo, thanks very much. Enjoy the day.
Cheers.
Johnny Vegas. He is an absolute star, and I'm sure, I don't know whether it's just me, I'm sure he's wearing exactly the same suit as Angus Loughran. I think they had it made by the same designer. I think Jeff Banks has a lot to answer for. But I'm not sure that Martin Pike, just over my shoulder in the brown trilby, will be wanting to sign up Johnny Vegas to be one of his future jockeys, but you never do know. He is the most successful jumps trainer there's ever been. He's won 13 championships in the space of 15 years. He is phenomenal. He started training back in 1977. He's the son of a bookmaker. Peter Scudamore knows him as well as anyone because he helped him win a few of his 8 championships. So he was back on familiar territory when he went down to the Pike Mansion.
Martin Pike's drive and ambition has turned these stables into one of Britain's longest-running success stories. The public perception is of a scientific, ultra-efficient setup. It's more than that. It's a warm, very proud family business.
That's the French Racing Channel, top left. That's the SIS, which goes around to all the bookmakers. That's just at the races. And that's my favourite.
One of the great joys of coming down here for me is the friendly family atmosphere. I see there's a pile of grapes for me and a pile of grapes for Tony McCoy out the back there. I'm a bit annoyed that Tony McCoy's got more grapes than me. But
yes, well,
he's working, I can eat now, I don't have to eat grapes.
He's working today, because he always gives some little grapes and 2 wine gums to AP when he's riding locally, and we have to deliver those. And AP doesn't eat, as you know, so I think he looks forward to them. Yeah. And you were sport this morning with a few.
There's just one fence now between Bonanza Boy and victory in the Coral Welsh National. He jumps it well. Another great triumph for the Martin Pike and Peter Scudamore combination as Bonanza Boy.
This yard gave me the happiest days of my life. It was from here that the great horses were produced that made me champion jockey. The faces may have changed. This is the real Bandit. In my day, the Grand National winner Minnie Homer was stabled here. The Irish Gold Cup winner Carvel's Hill was just stabled over there. Granville again, the champion hurdle winner, was stabled just down here. 11 years since I packed up, but the success has rolled on. Martin Pike is going for his 14th Trainers' Championship. This year's Grand National is crucial to that success. How important is this title to you? Is it on your mind all the time against Paul Nicholls?
That's fine, you're going to ask me that. It's never on my mind. Of course it is. Yes, you want to win. We've won 13 times, been very fortunate, very lucky. The whole team down here has worked very hard, as I'm sure everybody does. Perhaps we're just lacking a few horses this year. We've had the most winners, 154 winners, but we'll still be trying. There's big prize money on stake at Aintree. Of course, if we could win the Grand National, that would give us a great boost. But we'll run some good horses at Aintree and at Ayr and then see what happens. Of course we do our best, and of course we're trying to do it again. 13 times might be unlucky, who knows, but we're pretty close, that's the main thing.
Hello, old boy. Jurison. Great, big, long-striding, slow horse. Ideally equipped for the Grand National. He stays and stays and stays. A lot of responsibility on you, isn't there, old boy? You've got to get round that Grand National and bring some prize money so Mr. Pipe can win his 14th Trainers' Championship. Jurison, his last run was a fantastic performance at Haydock.
That's right. He won the big £100,000 handicap up there. The Vodka Chase, fantastic run. Joey Elliott rode him and just kept going. Jumped and stayed really well.
Jurison has got this shot to pieces. He's about 8 or 10 lengths clear on the run-in. And with a half furlong left to go, it's Jurison, Joey Elliott, on this Martin Pike trained stayer who comes up to the line to win it well in the David Johnson colours.
Good old Jurison, smashing all right. Big, long, lean horse. Loves this gallop. Knows exactly what he's doing. As soon as I came up here the second time, switched on, tried really hard for me.
What would you ride in the National? That's a choice.
Jurison,
there you are, you see. I shouldn't ask him that, should I? There's Jamie. What would you ride if you had the choice of the National, Jamie?
Actress.
I could say I'm going to do that.
There'll be money passing hands in a minute.
Yeah, let's ask Tom Skew. If you had the choice, what would you ride, Tom?
Bounce play.
Bounce
play. Minnie Homer has done it. Martin Pike trains the winner of the National, owned by Freddie Starr.
Martin, it's wonderful to see Minnie Homer looking so well and happy in his retirement.
21 years old, are you, aren't you, sometime?
21, is he?
21, yeah. 21 and still going strong.
Is it always a special race to you?
I think it is. The whole world can see the Grand National, don't they? A fantastic race. Really exciting. I've won it once. It's the biggest thrill of your life. It really is. I've done that and you haven't.
Well, Skew was third once. Norman Williamson standing alongside me has been second in the race. Martin Pipe is extraordinary. He's got so much energy. He bustles
around. If you had his horses in as good a form, it'd be unbelievable, wouldn't it? But he's got well chief in the next race, and he'd be looking for prize money everywhere.
Absolutely, because Martin Pipe at the moment is locked in a really tight battle for the Trainers' Championship. Pipe trying to win his 14th. Paul Nichols trying to win his first. And Paul Nichols has edged ahead in the prize money contest. Just over £2 million he's won. Martin Pipe at the moment trails him by around about £48,000. So the result of our next race here at Aintree could bring that even closer together, because there's £43,490 to the winner, and Martin Pipe is represented by Well Chief, who will be ridden by AP McCoy, and as the Arkle winner has an outstanding chance.
Yes, looked really well in the paddock, just nicely on his toes. Distas and Dudder, his main rival, he fell at Cheltenham. Well, he looks super as well, but this fellow Well Chief will probably go off favourite. And Distas and Dudder, you can see him in the picture now, and he really big, beautiful horse, but he'll have to jump better than he did at Cheltenham. And the other horse from the Paul Nichols yard was Van Ottery, and he looks well as well, and he's also got a tongue tie back on today.
Van Ottery is the most fabulous walker, whereas this, that and t'other to me just does something a bit funny with his hind leg, but sometimes it doesn't stop him. He was a faller last time at Cheltenham. Joe Tizard takes the ride because Ruby Walsh is out of action today. Ruby won the race last year for Paul Nichols, who in fact has won it for the last 2 years, Armaturk and Leroy Miguel. 12 fences to be jumped over 2 miles. Let's get a word then with Paul Nichols, who has this, that and t'other, and Van Ottery. He's with Rishi.
Yes, Paul Nichols certainly holds the key to this race, and Van Ottery, the horse that travelled very well in the Queen Mother Champion Chase at Cheltenham, he didn't have the tongue tie on that day, but he's got the tongue tie on today. Will that make the difference to him?
It should do. I think the big thing is it's a novice chase rather than a champion chase. It's also a flatter track which will suit him. Shame it rained, really. Obviously the faster the ground, the better for him.
Can you choose between him and this, that and t'other?
I mean, on his run in the Champion Chase, that was a great run. I mean, this out and t'other's done nothing wrong bar his fall the other day. He's in good order, and if you'd given Joe the choice, Joe would have ridden this out and t'other.
OK, Paul, thanks very much. Wish you all the best. Let's get all the runners and riders now with Jim.
Thanks, Rishi. Yes, runners going to post now. One is Bonus Bridge, Mark Bradburn. Two is Emperor's Guest, Robert Power. Three, Calcom Moma, Richard Johnson. Mr. McGoldrick is Dominic Ellsworth. Nev Brown, Carlo Allen. No Shenanigans, Mick Fitzgerald. Palua is Jimmy McCarthy. This, that and t'other, Joe Tizard replacing Ruby Walsh, who's not riding today because of his broken wrist. Ven Ottery is Timmy Murphy, and Well Chief, the Arkle winner, is Tony McCoy. They're the 10 runners, and they're on their way to post. Let's have a look now at the betting. A full show from Angus.
Well, three horses dominate the betting, and Ven Ottery is very weak in the market. It's out to 11-2. This, that and t'other, and Well Chief, though, are the 2-1 joint favourites. There's been support for Calcom Holmes, 20-16, and Palua, very popular, that one, at 25-1. Most boards are showing shorter than that, and also Bonus Bridge and No Shenanigans, they're two outsiders being backed. So this morning, people would have thought that these three horses would have dominated the betting. They are dominating the market, but they may just be a result for the bookmakers here. Joss Naylor being very well backed in the National, and he's now my tip to become a favourite for the Marcel Cognac Grand National due off at 3:45.
Well, this is a fascinating clash, and there is Well Chief, and he won the Arkle last time we saw him. That was the top race for 2 mile novice chasers, and he'd only actually run, that was only his second ever chase. At this point you can see a horse that he reopposes again today in fourth place, Mr. McGoldrick. He actually eventually falls in this race after having been headed. He does fall and then seats at the last. But there is Well Chief, and this is just his second chase start, Peter, and it was an incredible performance given that.
And the twice he's jumped from the last in front, he's made a mistake, and I just wonder if Tony McCoy will hold him up a little bit longer today, because some horses, Mini Homer was one, if he went to the last in front of them, they would just put down on you. He came to win his race very, very easily, and when he got there, he making that mistake just lost a little bit of energy. He gets a £3 allowance off the other horses for just being a five-year-old. He is a very, very talented individual.
And that is the crux, because when he was just beaten in the Triumph Hurdle last year, again, they thought he'd got there a little bit too soon. I think we're going to have a very exciting here late challenge.
Will this track and the way that you expect the race to be run suit that kind of tactic, Richard?
Well, he's got lots of speed, so I think that he'd be able to travel, pull out. There's plenty of room between the second last and last. He wants to jump the last upside. That's my guess. I haven't spoken to anybody. Ben Ottery, there he is. Timmy Murphy rode him, ran a fantastic race in the Queen Mother Champion Chase.
The story about him, of course, is that he didn't have a tongue tie that day. He's a novice. He was up against seasoned top-class two-mile chasers. He was just running so well at that point. He didn't have a tongue tie because his owner had forgotten to declare it, and that meant he couldn't breathe so easily.
Well, I disagree with these tongue tie things. I think a lot of it's overdone. A tongue tie, they supposedly think horses swallow their tongues. Horses do not swallow their tongues. They dislocate a palate, which makes them gargle or makes a gargling sound. That cross nose band, the bridle, the bit held high in the mouth, keeping the mouth closed, stops the airflow over the top of the tongue. That sometimes will stop them gargling as much as a tongue tie will.
So you're saying that you expect no difference for a tongue tie being fitted?
No, I think the ground will make a big difference as much as the tongue tie. I think, you know, a lot, we were conned into this tongue tie about declaring about it. A lot of the time it doesn't make any difference.
The results will tell you different. A lot of horses that have them first tied down go in.
I agree.
And although they can't swallow their tongue skew, it can ball up in the back of their throat. You know, when you're jogging in the morning, you go sprint the last 200
absolute
yards.
Rubbish.
Well, they are. It's a game of opinions.
Well, Peter Skidmore is shaking his head, but we'll have to go on to other horses. The Flat Trot will certainly help him breathe easier as well. His stablemate is This, That and T'other. Now, he was a big fancy to win the Arkle Chase, the race that Well Chief did go on to win. But This, That and T'other made a mistake at the first and then fell at the second. We didn't see much of him, Richard.
No, but I think he'll be suited better by flat tracks. Going to Cheltenham, lots of good judges were giving negatives because of the
were they? I mean, to me, he kicked the first side of the ground. He never jumped either fence, so that would be a worry to me. I mean, he looked as if there was something wrong with him. Obviously, there wasn't, because, you know, Paul Nicholls wouldn't be producing him today, but he nearly fell at the first.
Yeah, but he has looked a very exciting horse.
You know, I agree, but I mean, he's jumped so well and suddenly kicked two fences out of the ground.
And Joe Tizard, of course, riding because Ruby Walsh broke his wrist yesterday. It's a hard old game.
Yeah, it's a real shame for Ruby Walsh.
Harvey Smith and Terry Biddlecombe, and that looks like Hen behind there swapping a few stories. None of them would be repeatable, of course, though, would they? Henrietta Knight smiling. She got a lot to smile about. Three gold cups in a row. David Minton, the bloodstock agent there. He's probably bought and sold a few of these horses. And I don't know. Is Biddlecombe losing his hair? I don't know.
No, stay steady there. Steady.
Well, runners Billy, coming in quickly.
No.
I think the star is going to tell them just to
we had this yesterday. Now pack
hold
it
your horses, quite literally.
Get off the tape and go back and walk in properly.
No, we're like just coming in that that little bit too rapidly.
Timmy, are you going to be at
likely
the back? Well, you tell
he
me.
Asked them to walk back and just take a turn, coming in a bit more sedately.
Right, turn him in there.
Well, Chief
quietly
on a second from the left, and Ven Ottery on the left.
Stay,
two very
stay
talented
there
jumpers.
Stay there. Stay there!
Coming in.
No. Wait.
Starter holds them.
Come on, get behind those ponds and don't come in.
I don't know what's going
ponds
on now, because
are you happy at the
it looked
car
as if they could get off to a pretty good start there.
Right, now turn them in from there.
Very short run for the first
in
turn. They
not
jump
even
one before they
right
get there as well.
Come on then.
That's it, racing. Ben Ottery and Well Chief beginning in the rear of the field. Let's see how This, That and T'other jumps the first. Cheltenham, he didn't do it too well. He's popped over it quite nicely, and they're all over the first safely. Ben Ottery well back in second last position and held up. Emperor's Guest going on here from in second. Palua on the inside, followed by Mr. McGoldrick, and This, That and T'other up on the outside in the red and white. Just anxious to go a bit faster from Bonus Bridge as they come down to the first in the straight, which is a plain fence. The first five jump it well. No shenanigans back in the field. Rider's lost his cap. Then Kelkamome on the outside from World Chief, who's in a white cap on the inside. Ben Ottery is well back as they come to the first ditch. And they're getting over it in the lead here. Emperor's Guest just showing the way. Nev Brown losing touch with the field, about 8 or 10 lengths behind the second last horse. Good races. They come up towards the fourth, which is the one in front of the stands, and getting through on the inside, Palua, to join Emperor's Guest. And Mr. McGoldrick making a line of three on the near side. Half a length away then is Bonus Bridge. A length and a half further back is This, That and T'other. A gap then of 6 or 8 lengths to No Shenanigans, followed then on the outside by Kelkamome. Further back is Well Chief, 4 or 5 lengths to Ben Ottery, and 8 or 10 to Nev Brown, who's losing touch. Out of the straight now, very sharp left-hander as they head towards the back, and the leader here on the inside, Emperor's Guest, by 2 lengths to Mr. McGoldrick. A half length away on the inside is Bonus Bridge. On the outer next is This, That and T'other, who seems to be going pretty well at this stage of the race. 2 lengths away then Palua. 4 or 5 lengths further back in the field as they go to the fifth is Well Chief, just passing No Shenanigans in air there. Further back is Ven Ottery from Kelkamome and Forget Nev Brown, as they continue their journey down the far side of the course. And coming to the sixth, Emperor's Guest on the near side from Mr. McGoldrick. They jump it well from This, That and T'other, who's grabbed hold of the bridle now and is starting to loom up as a big danger. In behind them as they come to the second ditch is Bonus Bridge. As they jump that one, the first four jumping it well. They're clear then of Palua, then Ven Ottery from Well Chief, and No Shenanigans is well back in the field. Continuing their journey to the eighth, and Mr. McGoldrick with ears pricked jumped that well. But This, That and T'other are sticking with him in second. Bonus Bridge is scrubbed hard, followed by Emperor's Guest, who's now starting to feel the pinch a bit, although coming back again on the inside now as they bunch up around that turn and race to the cross fence. A gap in the field then to Palua from Well Chief, who's spotting the leader about 8 lengths start. Further back, Ven Ottery about 4 behind him, coming to 4 out. This, That and T'other hard ridden, but Mr. McGoldrick going well. It's Mr. McGoldrick the leader from This, That and T'other, being pushed along now. And then in third is Bonus Bridge. They've drawn away 4 or 5 lengths now to Emperor's Guest. Well Chief, McCoy riding ultra confidently on this. He hasn't moved a muscle and it's cruising into fourth, but still 6 lengths off the pace. At the third last, the leader absolutely fluent. But Mr. McGoldrick jumping well out in front, 2 or 3 in front now of Bonus Bridge, and This, That and T'other. Then 3 away is Well Chief, now called on for an effort at the open ditch. He's asked for a big one and immediately he comes into the race. One left to jump, Mr. McGoldrick the far side. Here's Well Chief being produced now on the near side. The one with the white face looms up, grabs the lead now with one to jump. This, That and others all out, can't find much more as they've got one left to jump now, and Well Chief about 4 in front, draws towards it, jumps it well, lands 2 or 3 in front of This, That and T'other, and the Arkle winner, Well Chief, very confidently ridden by Tony McCoy, comes up to the line to win this in good style. Well Chief by 4 or 5 lengths. In second then is This, That and T'other. Third is Mr. McGoldrick. A gap then to Bonus Bridge, followed by Emperor's Guest, and behind them is Palua. A gap to Ven Ottery, who never got into it from No Shenanigans. And last on the outside, Kelkamome. Then Brown pulled up. Well Chief though, that was an ultra, ultra confident ride from the man who will be wearing these colours later today in the big one, the Grand National. He'll be riding Durenson for David Johnson and also for trainer Martin Pipe. And that is the exact combination that have won this Martel Cognac McGill Novices Chase with number 10, Well Chief. Second is number 8, This, That and T'other, owned by C.G. Roach, trained by Paul Nichols and ridden by Joe Chizard. And third is number 4, Mr. McGoldrick, owned by Richard Longley, trained by Sue Smith and ridden by Dominic Ellsworth. Fourth is Bonus Bridge. But there is Tony McCoy. Can he win the big one later?
We've seen a great riding performance here, A.P. McCoy, and we indicated before that he would hold up even later than he did at Cheltenham. But what a good little horse this is to come off of such a fast pace from so far behind. This, That and T'other had 4 or 5 lengths on him as we join him here, Scoop.
Yeah, he's still got a lot to do here, hasn't he, Well Chief? McCoy in fourth place, yes. He didn't jump the fence before all that well. You know, we thought that might have got him beat, but what he does, he will race off the bridle, won't he, when McCoy picks him up and goes. But it's a tremendous riding performance. You you and I have got the privilege of trying to judge the best riding performance of the week. Well, this is right up there with them again. I mean, to me as a jockey, I hated dropping them out too far because you're always worried whether they're going to stop in front. And especially on a horse like Well Chief, McCoy must have thought three out whether he would do it or not. But he's jumped the last really well. He's beaten this, that and the other here today, Lydia. Would the track have made any difference at Cheltenham if this, that and other would have stood up?
I think he's just the better horse. I think we now know what would have happened if this, that and t'other and the third Mr. McGoldrick had all stood up. Well Chief would have won anyway. That's a really impressive performance. This, that and t'other had every chance. I mean, Well Chief was 8 lengths behind the leader, 4 out. Mr. McGoldrick had 8 lengths to find him in, and this is Mr. McGoldrick in pinch. A bonus bridge looming up on the outside. He threatens briefly, a big race from him, but there is Tony McCoy delivering Well Chief, and goodness, this horse is classy.
He's not particularly big, and we say so often they don't need to be. Often the bigger the horse, the bigger the problems you can get, but he responds to driving.
Yeah, he's a German bred horse, isn't he? I think they bought him off the flat in Germany. I remember seeing my son Thomas win on him his first hurdle race at Kempton, and didn't really fulfill the promise he did. They thought he did over hurdles, but now they're riding him different, dropping him in. He's showing his true potential.
A horse that we can't see in shot at the moment, but the stablemate of this, that and t'other, the eventual second, Ven Ottery, was very, very disappointing. Do you think, Peter, it might be a long, hard season catching up on him?
Yeah, it could be a long, hard season. And we're talking about the gargling. I think the rain's just got into the ground a little bit. That is, he wants top of ground. That helps his wind as well.
I don't think it's a long, hard season. He's just had so many races close together. There's only so many miles in any horse, isn't there?
Tony McCoy, later on today, will have his 9th ride in the Grand National on Jurançon. So far, the race has been a major disappointment to him. He's won only finished 3rd twice. All of the times he's failed to complete the course. But this might be his day. This just might set the scene for him. He's saying that there's the winner's enclosure. That's where we're going. Well Chief coming in there now. This gelding by Night Shift. A good shot of him there. The distances, 2.5 lengths and 5, and here are the SPs and totes.
Well, second win of the afternoon for number 10. Well Chief, a very impressive and well back 15-8 favourite, the winner. Second number 8, this, that and t'other at 2-1. Third number 4, Mr. McGoldrick at 12-1, all 10 round.
Well, the extraordinary thing about Well Chief is he's only a 5-year-old, so he's got a big, big future ahead of him. He was impressive today.
He was, and he's only a little horse, but a great ride from AP. Really, you know, loads of confidence, and absolutely, that's what you need today.
I mean, he did. He left him an awful lot of ground to make up. The difference being, at Cheltenham, he didn't fancy him at all. Today, he really did.
Really did, and the second last fence was the winning of the race, absolutely. Spotted a stride a mile away from it and pinged it, and great riding performance, really was.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind getting a word with AP just to find out what that ground was like. Probably risk upsetting the photographers. Just quick word, AP, how was that ground?
Yeah, it's definitely gotten a little bit clearer. It's just on the slow side, definitely, for those first to ground horses. I didn't think this fella would like it, and I don't think the horse in the National like it, but when this fella got away with it, then hopefully the next one will too.
Okay. Well, good luck to you. He'll be on board Jurançon in those same colours in the big race itself, the Grand National. But from a horse with his future very much ahead of him to some horses with their past behind them, one of the sort of intellectual rows among racing folk is who would have won the National if the likes of Red Rum and Corbière could have met each other? Well, we've got a very, very clever computer that has managed to put all the statistics in of 10 of the best winners from the last 30 years or so. So to find out who would have won if they'd all raced together. It's obviously still very speculative, but this is how they bet anyway. Rough Quest, who Mick Fitzgerald won on and said it was better than sex. We've done a handicap for it as well. So he'd be on 10-7. He was second in the Gold Cup before winning the National. He's 4-1 favourite. Lescargo, who'd won a Gold Cup, is 9-2 second favourite. Red Rum obviously won the race 3 times, was second twice. He's 5-1. Grittar's in there. West Tip as well, who won it for Richard Dunwoody. Rhyme and Reason. Aldeniti, who won it for Bob Champion in 81. Mr. Frisk, who actually set the fastest time in the race, still hasn't been bettered. The only horse to go under 9 minutes, 16-1 in this imaginary race. Corbière, a 25-1 shot, won it once for Jenny Pittman, was third twice, and Rag Trade also 25-1. Now Richard Pittman, Peter Scudamore and myself have all come up with our ideas of the winner. I've tipped Red Rum purely on the fact that he was a better horse at Aintree than he was anywhere else. I've got a few quid to put on him on behalf of the Injured Jockeys Fund at 5-1, and I thought that was a decent price. But whether he could have beaten Lescargo or not, certainly in the weights, Lescargo, you saw on the left a shot there. This is him after he had beaten Rummy in the National.
and he has been tipped by Peter Scudamore, I think. Ski, you went for him, didn't you?
I did. I went for the forecast, actually. I went Red Rum to beat Lascargo, but I'll stick with Lascargo.
And I was given Corbier purely because Scudamore was playing mischief. Yeah. So, Scoo, putting me in for Corby, I think he's badly weighted in this race, Scoo. You definitely stitched me up there. I'd have gone for Red Rum, given a choice.
Well, we all went for Red Rum, but Claire rang up before us. We know our place, don't we?
We've been totally bossed by women this year, and it's working wonderfully.
Richard, you're used to it, and that's probably why you picked Corbier, trained by your ex-wife, Jenny. Anyway, let's see what the computer made of those 10 runners. Commentary in great style from Jim McGrath.
They're all lined up, they're set to go, stand by, and they're racing in the National. And Mr. Frisk was one of the first away with Rough West, and up there too is Corbier. Rag Trade there as well, and West Tip just behind them from Red Rum as they go over the chair. And it's Mr. Frisk and Rough West together. Just behind them is Rag Trade, and further back is West Tip from Red Rum. Lascargo is back in the field from Oldenini, and then Grittar and Ryman Reason as they go over the water. And it's Mr. Frisk with a clear advantage over Corbier. In third is Rag Trade from Rough West and West Tip. Behind them is Red Rum, and further back Lascargo. But as they continue their journey towards Beaches, and Corbier jumps it in the lead. Corbier from Mr. Frisk. Then a gap of about 6 or 7 lengths to Rag Trade in third, followed by Rough West and then West Tip from Lascargo. Ryman Reason giving them a big start at the canal turn, and what a schmozzle it was there, and Mr. Frisk has dived through on the inside, but joined by Lascargo. Lascargo getting up there, and Grittar coming into it now from Oldenini. Here's Red Rum down the outside with Ryman Reason coming from nowhere. It's Red Rum who takes it up now on the run in. Lascargo is fighting back now from Ryman Reason. Red Rum in front, Lascargo trying hard, but Red Rum, he's too good, Rummy. Red Rum wins it from Lascargo. Third is Ryman Reason, and fourth Grittar.
So thanks to Labrooks for giving us all 100 quid. I've won 600 quid on Red Rum. What are you shaking your head for, Pittman?
We all wanted it. You just were bossy and took it for yourself.
Listen, just because I could judge the race a little quicker than you could, you were slow off the mark, it was your fault. The main thing is £600 go to the Injured Jockeys Fund, and I'm sure they'll appreciate it. We're running a competition, actually, to try and raise some money for Sport Relief, which is coming up this summer. And it's a very straightforward question, so do phone in. You've got a great chance of winning full hospitality for a party of four to next year's Grand National. If you can answer this question, who won the 2003 Martel Cognac Grand National? Was it A, Monty's Pass, B, Supreme Glory, or C, Bindery? You can call 090 65 500 400, or you can text National plus your answer to 82125.
Oh, Ginger McCain had no doubt that Red Rum was going to win that race as well, didn't you?
Well, I didn't have any doubt. I thought it would be between two, him and Lascargo, to be quite honest. And somebody put Request in front of him in the betting, and it only proves what I thought. Those computers are bloody rubbish. It takes intelligent people like yourself and myself, my dear, and one or two others to prove it. No, I thought he was entitled to do that, and the other horse was a very, very good horse. Never got the credit he was entitled, to be honest. Put in Rough Quest,
Faith. Don't worry, won the race.
Oh, well, he did, but he would have done anyway.
But it's amazing to think that it's 27 years ago that Red Rum won his third national here, but I suppose the memories are just as sweet for you now, aren't they, Ginger?
No, they're not bittersweet. They were lovely. They were magic.
Sorry, and I said just as sweet.
Oh, sorry, no, just, yes, they are, seriously, you know, it's not, I'm getting a bit longer in the tooth nowadays, and, you know, I'm struggling sort of, not, I don't know, it was great. They were magical, magical days, you know. But what a great thing to see this course like it's been this last couple of days. It's really seriously good. The old lad's gone. I think I have a filly, a five-year-old filly that's related to him. I think she's probably not worth a carrot, but I mean, I'm going to hang on to her because it keeps me with the family. But no, they were very, very special days. But the other horse never got the credit he was entitled to, Lascargo. Mm. He was a very, very good horse indeed. No question about that.
But let's talk about Red Rum, because this is his day. I mean, have you been to visit his grave over the past couple of days?
Yes, I have. We were going home last night, and I just had a quick peep at him. We brought some flowers for him today. and I was putting the flowers. There were a number of roses, and a number of people had brought us some flowers and that sort of thing. And I put about a dozen, and they were red anyway, I think they were roses. And the thought occurred to me, yes, that the flowers had probably cost more than the old horse did when he was bought as a yearling.
Absolutely, and we saw those wonderful pictures of him on the beach at Southport, which are vivid in everyone's memory. But what about this year? Because you have a real chance as well with Amberleigh House.
I think we've got a very, very serious chance indeed. But amazingly, when the old horse was running, I used to get a bit wound up, a bit edgy. I'm completely switched off. I'm very, very relaxed. I'm eternally grateful to John Hailwood to give me the chance with another decent horse to come here. He's a good Liverpool horse, a seriously good Liverpool horse. But you know, there's 39 other horses in the race behind him. He's very, very fit. I make no excuses for him whatsoever. He's not just fit, he's got a fine edge to him as well. And if he gets a clear run, luck in running, which everything needs around his running, if, which I hope will happen, five or six horses come across that Melling Road with chances and mine's amongst them, I don't give a toss whether we win or lose. We run a big race and it's been great, and it's Aintree and it's a grand national, and I'm delighted to be involved.
Well, and I'm delighted to speak to you because you mean so much to this day as well, and we wish you well and hope he comes home safe.
Well, it's lovely, seriously lovely to be here. It's really great to see the place buzzing so much. It's magic.
Yeah, it is magic. Good luck, Ginger.
Many thanks.
Yes, I'm down here at a very formidable fence with the best equine photographer on the course, Colin Turner. You've been here many years. Did you manage to get a snap of Rummy before you started?
Before my time, John, I saw Red Rum win all his nationals, and he did jump this chair particularly well. Brilliant, really.
Yeah, this fence, of course, has provided you with some of the best shots. You've won competitions, haven't you, with this fence?
I have won competitions. We had a competition winner with, I know this is the chair, but you didn't have to sit on it. And also Chris Pimlock came a cropper here, and it was Arrogant Boy. I know you're in there somewhere looking for him over the fence, you know.
Now, there are people who think this is a little bit easier than it used to be, but you don't agree, do you?
I don't agree that the fence is any easier. The ditch is still 6-7 foot wide, and I've seen the top jockeys, McCoy, Fitzgerald, all the top ones, looking at this before racing, thinking it's still there, it's still got to be jumped.
Yeah, now this will be the fence you'll be positioned at. How many years have you been here?
I've been at this fence 21 years, John, since Corby Air won, and over those years we've had some spectacular shots and some good jumps as well.
Well, here's hoping you get the shot you want, and everybody comes home safe and sound.
Oh, that's the main thing, everyone safe and sound, John.
Thanks, Colin.
Red Rum still loved and remembered here. Of course, he won 3 Grand Nationals, but more importantly, he won his place into the heart of a nation when he won for the third time in 1977. He's the horse they all try to emulate. Grey horses are very popular with the public. One of 3 greys in today's Grand National is What's Up Boys. He's trained by Philip Hobbs, and Liddy Hislop paid a visit to his beautiful home in Somerset.
It's idyllic here on the Somerset coast, in the shadow of Dunster Castle. In this tranquil setting, one trainer is quietly in the ascendancy. Philip Hobbs is the latest superpower to emerge from the West Country, ensuring his neighbours Martin Pipe and Paul Nichols don't have things all their own way. So what's the secret of them there hills?
Well, I've really got no idea. I mean, when we started training in 1985, I was concerned. The only way we could start training, or I could afford to start training, was to start here. And I was very concerned it'd be an unfashionable place to start training. And now, you know, sort of things have changed around the other way and it's become fashionable. So that's the way things change. Why? I really don't know. I think it's probably mainly coincidence.
More likely, it's the fruits of very hard work. From starting out with a handful, he now has over 100 horses in his yard. And in the National today, he's represented by the high-achieving grey, What's Up Boys.
He's done much, much better than we could have thought possible. He won his novice chase at the Aintree Festival. He won the Coral Cup at the Cheltenham Festival. He won the Novice Hurdle at the Punchdown Festival. And besides that, he's won the Hennessy and second in the Grand National, so there aren't too many that have done that in their lives, is there?
Coming up towards the last fence now in the National, and jumping it together, What's Up Boys and Bindaree. They race in towards the final 100 yards of the National. What's Up Boys on the near side. Bindaree is coming back at him with every stride on the far side. Bindaree is wearing it down. He's pulled it out of the fire. Bindaree gets up to win the Grand National. What's Up Boys, a gallant second.
It looked like he'd win half at the running, you know, and he had to be chuffed. He ran a very good race, but at the same time, it's obviously frustrating to be second, you know.
And strangely enough, you happen to be standing next to Nigel Twiston Davis, the trainer of Bindaree, who actually won the race. And
yeah, you were down the start with us as well. Yeah, I mean, it was we watched the race from the start. There's a big screen down there, and No, it was a very unusual thing in a way, but I mean, obviously it's turned out sort of well in a lot of ways, because Nigel's still training and Binderee hadn't won, he wouldn't be, so, you know, swings and roundabouts.
Did you say anything to each other during the race, and particularly during the running?
I think Nigel said something to me, like when they jumped the last well done or something, and then would you believe it, you know, he's gone past me again with Binderee, and so it was his first reaction was to say sorry afterwards. But there you are.
Since that day, it's been tough going for What's Up Boys. His devoted groom has walked her noisy charge around this pool more times than she can remember to rebuild his strength and fitness following a serious leg injury.
I don't think, you know, that the injury is likely to reoccur or anything with the race. You know, he's going to have a lot of weight still. The handicapper hasn't relented much. But I suppose the biggest worry about the race, really, he's only had one race in the last 18 months. You know, that's more of a concern.
So is he sort of battle hardened? You mean sort of?
Yeah, it's just whether, you know, he's 10 years old now, and whether he retains the ability he had when he was 8 years old, when he was second in the race. But we'll find out on the day.
Philip hopes to greet not one but two triumphant greys this afternoon. Stable star Rooster Booster runs in the Martel Hurdle, seeking a new crown after he was dethroned as the champion hurdler last month.
I really think the horse ran to his best, and Hardy Eustace on the day was the better horse. I've got to be very pleased with his performance, although it's got to be disappointing to be second.
What kind of horse is he? Is he the kind of horse who knows who's won the champion hurdle, knows he's lost the champion hurdle? Is he a bit starry?
he's actually very, very straightforward to deal with in every way. When he's cantering, he's quite strong, so he pulls quite hard. The only other thing, though, is he enjoys all the media attention. He's very, very good for the cameras and everything. He stands there with his ears pricked. He likes all that.
He likes posing for photos.
Oh, yeah.
Is What's Up Boys like that?
He's probably not been noticed quite so much, actually. Rooster Booster, they were fairly close to each other as well, but I suppose Rooster Booster's had all the attention recently.
Imagine yourself standing there, What's Up Boys, at the last, leading. What would it mean to you to win the Grand National?
Well, first of all, you'd hope that he'd hang on this time, but to win the Grand National would be absolutely phenomenal, because it's the one race that everybody knows about all around the world, really, so to win it would be terrific.
Philip Hobbs has got the grey horse. What's Up Boys then, representing him in the National. He's got a grey horse in the next, just coming around behind us, Rooster Booster. It's a very high class hurdle, this. Rooster Booster won the champion hurdle 2 years ago, got beaten in it by Hardy Eustace this year, but he's got a great chance of putting things right. He finished second in this race last year, but he's got a great chance of putting it right this time.
Well, joining me now is Paul Carberry. Had that heavy fall, and we've heard you've had stitches in the lip. It looked very painful.
Yeah, it felt painful. Nice little slap in the mouth, all right.
Did they give you an anaesthetic for that, or did you just have to grin and bear it?
No, they gave me a bit of a local anaesthetic, so it wasn't too bad.
Nasty fall, though.
Yeah, not nice. Sure.
So what about, does that have any effect on you, or do you should put that behind you completely?
Behind me, a bit bruised, all right, but sure. Be all right, but soldier on.
So what about the chances today? And I want you to answer this, because my money's on Joss Naylor.
Well, I'm glad to see now the rain that came down about half an hour ago will help me a bit, slow the ground down a bit. So it should be in with a good show. Probably like it a bit softer, but we'll have to go with what we have today.
Class horse, though, isn't he?
Yeah, he has a lot of ability, so hopefully it'll come through in the end.
What's the plan then for you? Or do you have a plan, or do you just make up your mind as you go along?
Yeah, it's hard to really plan the race. You just have to jump out quick and get a bit of light and hope for a clear run and see what happens.
But of course, you know what it's like to win here. I think we remember your celebrations here in the winners' enclosure as much as anything, when you swang off the rafter.
Exactly, yeah. Hope they'll be able to do it again today, and that'll be nice.
Oh, we'll certainly look forward to that. And also, I mean, Claire was talking about your riding style, because you actually ride so much shorter than others. Why do you do that?
I suppose I started off on the flat, and I just never really put them down much when I went over jumps, and just comfortable riding that way. When I put them down a bit, I'm not that comfortable, so better off riding the way you're comfortable.
And the boys wanted to know if you actually had an early night last night.
I did. Early night every night this week, so.
Absolutely. Well, we wish you well. Good luck, and I hope it's not too painful.
Yeah, okay.
Cheers. Thank you.
Yeah, best of luck to Paul Carberry. Just to tell you, Tyne and Tyne again is a non-runner in the Martel Cognac Grand National. He's been taken out by trainer Richard Guest, so the field is down to 39. Tyne and Tyne again out, but as I was mentioning earlier, Rooster Booster in this field and plenty of other good horses. And Norman, you particularly like the look of a horse you used to ride.
Yes, you can just see him in the background, Rhinestone Cowboy. Looks absolutely fabulous, he really does. Nicely on his toes. Just John Joe's other runner, Into Sky Falcon, who also will be fancied. Whether he stays or not is a big worry. And further away in the background is Foreman, the French horse. He looks well, but I'd have to side with Rhinestone. He really looks a picture.
Well, just have a closer look at Rhinestone Cowboy, because he's going to go away from us there with JP Magna on board, the son of the owner. Big moment for him today, but also big moment for Terry McDermott, local Liverpool lad. Used to play for Liverpool and for Newcastle. Part of the big syndicate that owns Into Sky Falcon. You were third in the champion hurdle, but you've got a good chance of going a bit better today.
Well, if you look at the price at 9-1, I just think it's a steal, you know, on each way bet. He's got a great chance. Obviously, Rooster Booster is the one to beat. Everyone knows that, you know. You don't have to be a scientist to know that. But we're there. We're a fighting chance, and John Joe's quietly confident. Right, Rooster Booster, Rhinestone Cowboy is obviously a good horse. Norman's there. See, Norman's in. He's rode it before, so he knows how good it is. But we're there. We're a fighting chance.
And Terry, how much does it mean to you to be here at Aintree on Grand National Day with a runner?
Oh, it's unbelievable. I missed it last 2 years ago. I got dragged back to Newcastle on the Friday afternoon, so I missed it last 2 years ago. So hopefully today we'll be in the winners' enclosure. If we're in the winners' enclosure, finish second or third, I'll be absolutely ecstatic.
That'll be a big cheer for him. That's
it'll
a
be lovely. Well, you certainly get these lots anyway.
Good luck.
Thanks very much.
From a local Liverpool lad, Terry McDermott, to a local Liverpool lass, the lovely Claire Swinney joins me. Claire, it's lovely to see you. And we're just talking about the dress wear here at Aintree. Fantastic.
My comment was, you're practical and vain. Us Liverpool girls, we get our outfit ready and forget the weather, we wear it, we don't care. Now, I do have my shawl though, just in case.
Tell us, you are here just for basically a day out and a really good time on you.
Oh yeah, I love Aintree. I mean, I was born and bred like 10 minutes away, and last year was the first time I came to the races and had the most wonderful day. So I'm going to make it a ritual now every year.
Okay, who's going to win the big race, the Grand National?
I've put my money on Bunny Boiler, just because I like the name.
Is the name apt?
I hope not.
Claire, it's lovely to meet you and lovely to see you. I hope you have a great day.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
That's the first woman that Rishi's interviewed this week that he hasn't tried to pull. Let's move on then to the race details for our next one. And it's the big hurdle race of the day, the Martel Cognac Aintree Hurdle. It's a grade one race, which means it's the very top quality. Over 2.5 miles, 11 hurdles to be jumped, £87,000 to the winner. It was won last year by Secundi, beating Rooster Booster, before that by Ilnamar, and back in 2001 by Barton. Let's take a check on the field for the 2004 running with Jim.
Yes, Claire, a real cracking race this Martel Cognac Aintree Hurdle. One is Foreman, Thierry Dumen in the McManus colours. Into Sky Falcon is Liam Cooper, Munker Hoston, Carl Llewellyn, Quasar is Tony Dobbin, Rhinestone Cowboy, JP Magna, the amateur. Number six is Rooster Booster, out to avenge his defeat at Cheltenham, Richard Johnson. Sleep Val, here's Mick Fitzgerald. Sporazine, Joe Tizard, replacing injured Ruby Walsh. Starzan is Timmy Murphy, the French Furs, Graham Lee, and West Ender is Tony McCoy. They are the 11 runners, and the runners are coming down the walkway. They're very soon be out on the course. And let's have a look at the betting. A full show from Angus.
Well, it's a tremendous betting heat, this one. The race before the National, Rooster Booster and Rhinestone Cowboy are 5-2 joint favourites. Monica Hoston is 11-2 and Foreman 8 into Sky Falcon, popular here, 8-1 from 9s. Sporazine, that's been the each way horse in the race, 20 into 16s. West Ender is 25s with Kazar 33s, Starzan 50 and 100-1 bar. Still can't tell you who I think is going to be the Grand National favourite. My personal view is I think Joss Naylor, but when Tony McCoy wins on World Chief, there is also very good support for Durancon. Lots of action on the Grand National to come. Remember, 3:45, the Martel Cognac Grand National.
Well, this is an absolutely superb race, the Martel Cognac Aintree Hurdle, a grade one, 2.5 miles, and Rooster Booster, he was second in this race last year. Many people felt that he could have won it. Richard Johnson Skew lost his whip in the closing stages. There he is highlighted in fourth place. Well, the eventual fourth is Quasar.
This is the champion.
This is the champion hurdle, yeah, in fact. Yeah. This is Harder Usis in front. Rooster Booster lying second. And at this point, you can also see Foreman in the white cap, the JP McManus colours, on the inside on the rail. He's currently lying in third. Westender, Intersky. There's Intersky Polkemark for you on the outside, and also Westender in fifth. Now Rooster Booster finishes second. Foreman is. Is third. Foreman finishes fourth, and Westender is the eventual fifth. But Harder Usis is the one that wins it. This is where Rooster Booster is deposed from his crown. And if we just run it on, we can see what happens. Rooster Booster comes looming up. He even takes the lead at this point, Skew. But then Harder Usis comes back at him.
Yeah, I think Richard, he was just outstayed a bit up the hill. He had to make his ground up a little bit quick, didn't he? He ran a great race last year. I don't think the drop on the stick made much difference.
But also, you've got to realise he does go away from the placed horses behind him. From the time we joined it, Harder Usis has scooted away and won on merit, but Rooster Booster has gone away from the ones behind him. So, good run. But this race normally throws up 2.5 miles, extra half miles of it.
I don't think this is his optimum trip either. Do you think he was held up too far away from the eventual winner?
It's very difficult. He's a difficult horse to ride, isn't he? Because he pulls hard. I don't think he settles wherever you ride him, But he has made it at Haydock, didn't he? When he wasn't running very well, they rode him a lot handier. I know that Richard and Philip feel he's better held up, and the owner likes to see him ridden handy. It's difficult.
It's my view that Rooster Booster isn't so good over this distance. We can see him running over this exact course and distance. I mentioned it earlier. Here it actually is. Currently lying in second place is Quasar. He eventually goes on to finish fourth, and he reopposes today. And Rooster Booster is challenged on the outside by Secundi in the blue colours. He's the eventual winner, Richard. And in the closing stages, Rich Johnson drops his whip, and that does prove to be crucial.
Yes, it probably does. Some people say they run better without a whip, but who knows? He just gets beaten, so you would say, was there a little bit more in the tank? And it happens,
There it is. He's losing his whip at that point, and he has to go to hands and heels. Now, I take your point that some horses don't respond. I think Rooster Booster probably does.
I think so. I do agree with you. Yeah, he will respond for it. Richard Johnson, just try to change his hands. You see, by that I mean get hold of the reins, anything to wake the horse up. He's won everywhere, but where it mattered.
I don't think he'll thank us for reminding him of that particular incident.
It happens, Lydia. Yeah. It's a mistake. You can't legislate for it. It happens. I mean, I disagree with you. I don't think, one or two more cracks doesn't make any difference,
But when it's as close as that, Skew,
you
say...
Yeah, but the horse is doing his best to the line, isn't he?
Yeah, but even so.
You're going to say, he ain't going to give him two more cracks and he's going to do that, is he? He was doing his best.
He was doing his best. I think he might just be edged out today again.
What will win then, Lydia?
I think Rhinestone Cowboy will win, but we're not seeing him yet. Well, let's concentrate on Intersky Falcon first. He's going to like this flat track, but I'm not convinced that the extra 4 furlongs will suit.
No, he is a fast horse, but I must just mention Liam Cooper, the jockey, his brother Elliot, actually looks after this horse, had a crashing fall at Cheltenham, had to have his thigh bone taken out to rebuild his face, and he's actually here today as a guest of the owners. He's barely... should be here, but he's here. They're so into their horses, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. I mean, he like Ryan's Rooster Booster, is a difficult horse to ride, I think.
He's also
difficult to get your tactics right, isn't
he? He's also got a breathing problem, which may inhibit him a little bit.
That's what stops him.
But the whole point about this horse, they used to go like stink, and then decided, let's give him a chance, and he's better when he's relaxed.
Has he got a tongue tie on, running?
Yes, he has, yeah. Right, horse number 5 is Rhinestone Cowboy. Now, I think he should win this race, but the only reason why I say think is because the jockey, Mr. JP Magno, on board. He is the son of the owner. He's an amateur. He can't claim his £7 advantage riding against the professionals here because it's a grade one hurdle. And arguably, he should have won his last race when he finished third behind a horse. He reopposes here, Munker Hostin. If he had made a move earlier, I believe he would have won that race.
But it's more than that. Munker Hostin is better. It was much better off in the weights that day. I think Rhinestone does come into it very strongly. I agree with you. I think he'll win.
But can we rely on him, Skew, to deliver the horse, to move the horse, make the tactical decisions at split second speed?
Yeah. It's much easier around here than it is at Cheltenham. I didn't think the boy did much wrong at Cheltenham. He produced him with every chance. I thought he rode him beautifully at Haydock. I mean, I think when you're not right, when you're not as strong as the others, you're better to sit still. Just keep a horse balanced. I'd rather see a lad not do too much rather than flap about,
plenty of action here in the betting ring, as you would expect in the race before the Martel Cognac Grand National. We've got joint favourites, Rooster Booster and Rhinestone Cowboy. This is a tremendous race in its own right. Sporazine at 14 to 1 from 20 is the each way horse in the race. That one really supported rather strongly in the last few minutes.
Well, we're getting an awful lot of emails in from people enjoying the coverage. Among those watching, I know, is Malcolm Kemp, who directed the Grand National every year from 1997. He's suffering from a serious illness at the moment, and Malcolm, we wish you all the best.
We certainly echo that here in the studio as well. Number eight is Sporazine, and there's been a really big move for him in the market. We can have a look at his last time out when he won. This was in the county hurdle, and you're seeing there the grey horse. Now watch, sort of third from the left in your picture, in the red colours, coming out of the pack. Just jumping now is Howard. Now that is the eventual second. You may think that perhaps the horse who wins it, Sporazine, ran out of petrol while going up the hill. I think he actually idled. I think he's a pretty smart horse, Richard.
I think he's very smart. Remember, though, he was some way behind Rooster Booster, Monk Austin, Quasar and West Ender in the Tote Gold Trophy. But Paul Nichols thought this was one of his bankers of the meeting. Chopney was right.
Again, I have a worry about him stepping up in trip. I think he's best around a fast run 2 miles. Well, it's very, very exciting. Lots of different opinions. We're about to find out who's right. Over to you, Jim.
Thanks, Lydia. Yes, coming in, and they're racing in this Martel Cognac Aintree Hurdle. And Starzan, the first one to go on here from West Ender and Rhinestone Cowboy, up on the outside of the early stages. As they come towards the first flight here, they're jumping 11. In the centre is Foreman, who jumped it okay. Sporazine is just behind them, but it's West Ender in the early stages, vying for the lead with Starzan. And you can see Rooster Booster, the grey, right out the back there, about 10 or 12 lengths off the pace. But it's Starzan, joined by West Ender again as they go over the next. 2 lengths to Foreman, a half length then to Rhinestone Cowboy, who's up on the outside as they start to group up now and turning sharply left-handed. Further back in the field is Sleep Bell, followed by Quasar and Sporazine, and next on the inside is Munker Hostin. Into Sky Falcon, as expected, held up towards the rear with the French Furs, and also held up is Rooster Booster, absolute last, and about 12 lengths off the pace. Heading now across the top of the track, a long run before they reach the third, and Starzan is the leader by 3 lengths to Foreman. A half length on the outside is West Ender. They're a couple of lengths in advance now of Rhinestone Cowboy, who's very handy for JP Magna. Then on the outside next follows the grey Sporazine. Tucked in behind them is Quasar. Right there in the centre, Sleep Bell with the red cap. 2 lengths to Munker Hostin. They're followed next in the field by Intersky Falcon as they go over the third. The French Furs as well back, and Rooster Booster taking a fierce hold there in last position. He definitely wants to go a bit faster and would appreciate a bit more pace up front, I'm sure, and he just wrapped the top of that, and he's about 12 lengths off the pace. Heading up the home straight the first time, and Starzan the leader by 2 lengths to Foreman, for Thierry Duman in second, and the McManus colours in third then is West Ender as they clear that well. Rhinestone Cowboy in the dark blue on the near side, Quasar with the cheek pieces right over on the far side, followed then by Sleep Bell, then the grey Sporazine on the outer from Munker Hostin, a length and a half further back than the French Furs. They're followed next in the field by Intersky Falcon, and still Rooster Booster is whipping them in about 12 lengths off the pace. Starzan, though, just wanting to hang out at that turn, is the leader as they head to the back now. It's Starzan by 2 lengths to Foreman in second, 4 lengths away West Ender in third. A couple of lengths further back in the field, Quasar, followed by Rhinestone Cowboy and Sleep Bell, a length away way then is Sporazine from Munker Hostin. A length and a half further back in the field then the French Furs from Intersky Falcon, and still he's waiting on Rooster Booster, absolute last, as they go over the sixth. The leader's jumping well, Starzan, but now tackled by Foreman on the outer, who's anxious to take it up for Duman, and goes a half length clear. They're 2 or 3 lengths in advance of West Ender, and Rhinestone Cowboy is handy. In behind them, Quasar the inside, as they come towards the seventh. Further back, Sporazine seen out deep on the track, followed by Munker Host and Sleep Bell. Weldmack is into Sky Falcon, followed by this stage the French Furs and the grey Rooster Booster. As they come to four out, is spotting the leader about 8 lengths, and that leader is Foreman on the outer from Starzan, and then West Ender. They're 2 or 3 lengths to Rhinestone Cowboy up on the outside of Quasar, and Sporazine on the outer. Further back is Munker Hosten as they start to group right up from Sleep Bell and then into Sky Falcon. Rooster Booster's at the rear of that pack there, second last from the French Furs as they race across the top of the track. Only about 6 or 7 lengths covers the field, and it's Starzan on the inside of Foreman and West Ender. They're a length and a half to Quasar, followed on the outside by Rhinestone Cowboy. Further back is into Sky Falcon as they swing the corner. Rooster Booster, he's on the outside of the pack. He's within striking distance as they straighten up. He's got about 5 lengths to make up as they turn into the straight now. And they've got 3 left to jump. Starzan, Foreman, West Ender and into Sky Falcon coming there quickly. Rhinestone Cowboy still there in the center. Rooster Booster, the grey on the near side, yet to be produced. They've kicked away from Quasar. 2 left to jump now. Near side, it's into Sky Falcon, who lands over in the lead from West Ender. Rhinestone Cowboy veered over towards the inside. Here's Rooster Booster, who's been waited and waited and waited with. It's into Sky Falcon, the near side, grabbed now by Rooster. Rooster hits the front as they touch down over the last. He's got a half length in front. Into Sky Falcon, trying to wear him down, followed by West Ender. And Rhinestone Cowboy is coming home well. It's Rooster Booster, grabbed by Rhinestone Cowboy. Rhinestone Cowboy is going to get up and win it for the amateur, JP Wagner. He gets up to beat Rooster Booster. Third is West Ender. Fourth in then on the outside is into Sky Falcon, followed by Starzan and Munker Hosten, and further back is Foreman, Sleep Bell, then Quasar, Sporazine and the French Furs. Well, Richard Johnson waited and waited and waited. You couldn't think he could wait any longer, but he was outweighted by JP Magna, the amateur who's got up to win here for a famous Grade 1 victory in this Aintree hurdle on Rhinestone Cowboy. There he is, the biggest win of his career. This 19-year-old amateur studying in Dublin, son of John Magna and Sue Magna, the owner. And what a thrill this is for him today. Number 5, Rhinestone Cowboy, owned by Mrs. Sue Magna, trained by John Joe O'Neill, ridden by the amateur JP Magna. Second is number 6, Rooster Booster. Rooster Booster, owned by Terry Warner, trained by Philip Hobbs, ridden by Richard Johnson. And third, number 11, West Ender, owned by Matt Archer and Gene Broaders, trained by Martin Piper, ridden by Tony McCoy. And fourth is number 2, Into Sky Falcon. But that has set the place alight. Rhinestone Cowboy beating Rooster Booster in the Aintree hurdle.
And the reason that we get some scrimmaging here is because the race had been so slow early on. Look at Rhinestone Cowboy coming through. West Ender on the left of him as we're looking at him. Into Sky through, flew through on the rail. And, of course, the champion hurdler just poised to challenge. But they've gone no gallop.
No gallop. That's helped Rooster Booster. It means Richard Johnson hasn't dropped too far off the lead or hasn't had to. He does look a difficult ride. He steps at his hurdles now and again. This didn't help him. This could have cost him the race here, and I'm surprised he was able to pick up and go again. But JP Magna has done nothing wrong on this horse. As I say, he doesn't flap about on him. He gives him a smack there. He doesn't try and do too much on him. He keeps him balanced. He gives him a smack, just keeps him going. And it must be quite an awesome feeling, you know, as a young amateur, 19-year-old, you've got Tony McCoy to your right, Richard Johnson there to your right as well, two of the strongest finishers of all time. And as I say, the young boy there, he's got a hold of the horse's head, he's given him a smack, he's not trying to do too much. As I say, nice balance to the, and the horse has just kept on running, and Rooster Booster's run a superb race.
I think the horse has carried him there, really. But JP Magna's done really, really well to sit when West Ender came across into the left. And it proves to you, you can buy lots of things in life. You can even try to buy Man United, but you can't buy the feeling of seeing your horse, seeing your son beat the professionals in a Grade 1 hurdle. And that's what JP Magna's father just has done, John Magna.
They'll be very proud parents indeed, John and Sue Magna. 3/4 of a length and a half length. And of course, a very proud grandfather as well, the very famous MV O'Brien, Vincent O'Brien, this young man's grandfather, who was no such stranger to success here at Aintree, having won many races, including 3 Grand Nationals. But what a thrill this is. Tommy Stack is there, rider of Red Rum, and there he is congratulating JP Magna. It's John Paul, if you're wondering. But joyous scenes. Jonjo O'Neill coming over. This has been a fantastic victory.
A quite superb ride by JP Magna, the rider of the meeting arguably so far, to get that Rhinestone Cowboy, one of the 5-2 joint favourites home, ahead of Rooster Booster, won by 3/4 of a length, the other 5-2 joint favourite, with West Ender third at 25-1. A great race, the joint favourites first and second, and there was a tremendous roar when they jumped the last and were on the run in. 5-2 joint favourites.
So now it is time to begin our final build-up to the big race, the 2004 Martel Cognac Grand National, the world's greatest steeplechase, and our team are in place to bring you all the latest news from around the course. Claire will be getting the first view of the horses and talk to the connections in the loose box area. We'll have the views of Lydia, Richard and Scoo from the comfort of their studio overlooking the paddock. A nervous atmosphere is guaranteed in the jockey's room. Rishi will be reporting from there. Angus will be keeping a close eye on the odds in the betting ring. John will be watching from the stand with the owners and trainers. Over in Connor in Ireland, Brian will be with the fans, hoping that Monty's Pass can do the double. And our race commentator, Jim McGrath, in the commentary box high above the stands. He will call them home. But first, Jim, take us through the runners and riders for the 2004 Martel Cognac Grand National.
Well, let's see the 39 runners. Number one is Le Coudre, ridden by Conor O'Dwyer, has run against the best, including Best Mate. But the distance is a worry today. Christy Roach is the trainer. Number two is Monty's Pass, ridden by Barry Geraghty. It's last year's winner, attempting to become the first since Red Rum to win back-to-back Grand Nationals. Jimmy Mangan's the trainer. Number three, What's Up Boys, a grey, second to Binderee in the 2002 Grand National, has had injury problems. Richard Johnson takes the ride and Philip Hobbs is the trainer. Four is Alexander Banquet, a real classy jumper on his day. He's won an Irish Hennessy, but he's a mud lover. Is there enough mud here today? Shea Barry is riding for Willie Mullins. Number five is King's Mark, another grey. Hasn't been a grey since Nicholas Silver in 1961. Mick Fitzgerald takes the ride for Martin Todhunter. This horse was fourth to Binderee in 2002. Number six is Arctic Jack. This fellow will be staying on. He's one of three runners for the man who owns Blackpool Tower, Trevor Hemmings, and he'd love to win the National. Number seven, Risk Accessor, one of four in the race, owned by JP McManus. Was just beaten in the Triple Print Gold Cup in December, but the distance is his problem. Eight is David's Lad, an Irish National winner. It was going well when he fell in this race 2 years ago, and that was four fences from the finish. He was suspended from racing last year, that's why he wasn't here. Nine is Binderee. Look at him stride to the line. He won this race in 2002. He was sixth in last year's race, and he's since won the Welsh National. Next one up is number 10, El Capone. He's won six of his 47 starts, but he's never won beyond 2¼ miles, and he's not the best jumper. It'd be criminal if he beat the stars in this. 11 is Puntel. He's won 10 races and is owned by a keen Liverpool fan in Terry Neal, but he's a very hard ride for Danny Howard. Number 12 is Southern Star, who's running in his second Grand National. He was 14th last year, trained by Henrietta Knight, Best Mate's trainer. Number 13 is Hedge Hunter, an Irish horse who was bought to win the Grand National. He was fourth in the Hennessy Gold Cup at Newbury, and he was third in the Welsh National. Willie Mullins reckons he's spot on for today. 14 is Shardam. Tom Scudamore riding in his fourth Grand National, and he would love to emulate his granddad Michael, who won this race on Oxo in 59. His father Scoo, of course, Peter, didn't win it. 15 is Takagi, a good staying Irish chaser, who's a second Grand National ride for Davy Russell. Edward O'Grady is the trainer.
Number 16 is Josh Naylor. Well, Jonjo O'Neill's in form, we know that for sure. And some good judges say he's the one that they have to beat at the weights. Paul Carberry, Bobby Joe's rider in 99 is the jockey. 17 is Amberleigh House, representing Ginger McCain. He's running in his third Grand National, and he's tackling the big Aintree fences for the seventh time. 18 is the Bunny Boiler, curiously named Irish Chaser, who fell at the first fence last year, but he's won an Irish National and a Midlands National. Next one we see, take out Tyne and Tyne again. 21 is Gunnar Welburn, who's trained by Andrew Balding, the youngest trainer in the race at 31 years of age. Gunnar Welburn fourth last year. Number 22 is Kalami, a seventh Grand National raider for the French trainer Francois Boutin, Francois Dumain, I should say, and formerly raced in the colours of the Queen Mother. Number 23 is Durensong, trained by Martin Pipe and ridden by Tony McCoy, named after a district famous in France for its pudding wine. Number 24 is Royal Atalza, bought by the big gambler Terry Ramsden after winning a race at Auteuil in Paris. There'll be a big check to charity if he wins the race. 25 is Justin Depp, ex-Irish chaser, who was third in the Kerry National. He's ridden by Jim Cullity, who's attempting the double-double, Gold Cup and Grand National, for the second time. Number 26 is Exit to Wave, trained by Paul Nichols. A last-minute ride for the 24-year-old Bobby McNally, who takes over from injured Ruby Walsh. 27 is Clan Royal, a J.P. McManus owned horse with good credentials. He won the Topham Chase and the Beecher Chase here over the big fences. 28 is Acarus, loves the mud, Roddy Green in the saddle, and this is one of seven runners for trainer Martin Pipe, who won it with Minnie Homer. 29 is Spot the Difference. And if you look like Durensong, then you have to give this fellow a chance. He was second to Durensong at Uttoxeter in the Summer National. Number 30 is Bounce Back. He hasn't won a race since landing the At the Races Gold Cup over 3 miles, 5 furlongs at Sandown 2 years ago. Andrew Thornton, though, thinks he'll run well. 31 is Arden Scout, a fifth run over the big Aintree fences for him, but his first in the Grand National. He's a seventh ride in the race for Warren Marston. 32 is Bear on Board, a real stayer. He's improving all the time. He's trained by Alan King, and the more rain, the better for him. Number 33 is Lord Atterbury, another Pipe-trained runner. He's won over 4 miles at Cheltenham, but he was disappointing in the Fox Hunters at last month's festival. Mark Bradburn rides. 34 is Mantle's Prince, carrying the colours of Emlyn Hughes, the former England and Liverpool captain. And he ran last year. He unseated his rider at Valentine's the second time. 35 is Blowing Wind, running in the Grand National for the fourth time. He was third in 2001 and 2, and he was eighth last year. Jimmy McCarthy. 36 is Sky Cab, famous as Josh Gifford's last winner as a trainer. His son Nick has taken the license now, and this is his first season. Clayton Aspel in the saddle. 37 is Wonder Weasel. He ran last year, and he fell at the third fence. He also fell in the Beecher Chase. He just mightn't like the place. Number 38 is Smarty, who's running in his third Grand National, and he's a first ride in the race for Andrew Tinkler. Third, he was second in the 2001 Grand National on heavy ground. And number 40 is Luz Cadu, who's performed badly in his two runs so far over the big fences, and he just might find it beyond him today. Getting off the horse box there, number 39, one of the reserves, who gets a run, that's Montreal. He's a first Grand National ride for 22-year-old Joey Elliott, who won on Durensong at Haydock recently. And finally, number 20, Bramble Hill Duke, who's attempting to uphold Grand National tradition here, ridden by 19-year-old James Davis, son of Huell, who won on last Saturday.
And this is last year's winner, Monty's Pass, all saddled up and ready to go. Mary, are you all right?
I'm fine, I'm more nervous than heart.
I think you probably are. I'll let you take him out into the paddock. There are an awful lot of Monty's Pass fans ready to watch him in Connor with Brian Gleeson.
Yes, Claire, as you spoke to Jimmy and Mary, a great sense of excitement and anticipation here at Connacht, the winner's enclosure. With me, Father Michael Reid. We're in the county of Cork, steeped in grand national history.
Soaked in it, Brian. I was born the other side of the street from Cottage Rake, winner of the Gold Cup at Cheltenham 3 years in a row, trained by Ed, the great MV, who himself trained three winners, Ellie, Mist, Wild, Tan and Quare Times. And we hope that Jimmy will follow in those footsteps today. And if he does, there'll be cracks in the roof here. And there'll be a hooly out at Jimmy's house tonight. God bless you.
Can he win?
I think he can. I'm backed him each way. I paid for my house last year, but I'm backing Clan Royale as well, just to be sure. And Father, what about the holy water?
Well, there was barely no holy water on him last year. There's barely no holy water on him again this year. So please God, he'll come through again like last year.
We're hoping he'll win. And the priests are praying for an Irish trained winner. We're here on the winner's enclosure. Back to the winner's enclosure entry.
Well, we're in action in the jockey's room now, and the tension's building up all the time. Mick Fitzgerald with me, along with Andrew Tinkler. Mick, of course, has won the race before with Rough Quest. Andrew having his first ride. Have you been giving any advice, Mick?
Not really. He's spoken to Timmy Murphy, who knows the horse better than anybody, and spoken to Mark Pippin, who's been around here. So it's a lot of potluck. You know, we've all seen it time and time again. You can have the best ride in the race and something can be prostrate in front of you. You've got no way of getting out.
How are the nerves holding up, Andrew?
Very good. Surprising, yeah. I thought I'd be very nervous, but I'm okay, so it's fine.
Okay, guys, we wish you all the best. Come back safe and sound.
Thanks.
Well, Edward O'Grady is here with Takaji. He can't bollock me today, that's for sure. Edward, how is he?
Well, Norman, I don't know whether it's you or whether it's the National, but I've never seen this horse sweat before. He turned a little sweat today. Maybe it's the thought of seeing you. I don't know.
Do you fancy his chances?
If he could tell me whether he got out of bed the right side, he's got a hell of a chance. And if it goes right for him, he's got every shot in the world.
We're in super form here. Claire, have you caught up with someone in good form as Edward O'Grady here?
Sarah Hobbs, the wife of the trainer Philip Hobbs, has just been saying to Katie, who looks after What's Up Boys, calm down. Hello, boy. Are you all right?
Not really.
Why?
I'm just a bit scared.
I mean, this horse had it won a couple of years ago, didn't he? And then Bindery came past him.
Yeah, it's a bit disappointing, but I'm just glad he got home, so.
Exactly, and he's been badly injured since then, but he's back fit and sound now?
Yeah, he seems fine, yeah, good form, yeah.
Okay. Well, do you think you're going to win What's Up Boys?
Yes.
Sarah. It's all a bit tense, this, isn't it? You look incredibly smart, by the way, to be working and saddling up here. But he loves the fences, which helps.
He loves the fences, and the ground's fine for him. He's in very good form. It's just a shame he hasn't got a stone less in weight.
Exactly. He has got an awful lot of weight. But good luck to What's Up Boys.
Well, still, we don't know who's going to be the Grand National favourite, Duranson or Joss Naylor. I think you can be pretty sure it's down to those two. But What's Up Boys is being very popular amongst the housewives, and I think that that's a horse that will come in the market soon. But it's 10-1, Duranson and Joss Naylor at the moment. They're joint favourites. David's Lad is 12-1, Bindery, the former winner, 12-1, Hedge Hunters 12-1, and Clan Royal 12-1. Can you ever recall a Grand National has opened this? I certainly can't. Not at this time. I'm anticipating money for Duranson and Joss Naylor to shorten those up, but the rest, anything can happen. Amberleigh House, 16-1, also very popular. Shardam, 18-1. Monty's Pass, last year's winner, is a 20-1 chance. Now we come into the bigger price contenders, and they include What's Up Boys, the Grey, very popular at 25-1, as is Le Coudre at 25-1. Now, Accuracy, it can't be soft enough for that one, 33-1, and also amongst those outsiders, Lord Atterbury at 40. Spot the difference, 50-1, going well last year. Blowing Wind, number 35 there, fourth twice at 100-1. And a former also runner-up, Smarty, at 100-1. That's one of the outsiders. They're the rank outsiders. Remember to look out for those that pay five places as well.
It is so tense here in the jockeys' wearing room. The 40 jockeys who are riding in this year's Grand National have been taken into the next room where they've been talked to by the stewards at the moment to obviously go a bit slow as they go to the first fence. They've got to take their time. It's a long way, 4.5 miles. It is really tense in here. I tell you what, it's very exciting.
Yes, controversial horse here of last year, David's Lad. He looks in good form.
Yeah, he's beginning to come now, I'm all right. Just fitness-wise, now would have liked one more galloping. Other than that, I couldn't be happier with him.
Well, Tony Martin, a word from the trainer. He'd bite your head off, wouldn't he?
Yeah, he's in good twist, all right. He's really coming, as I say. Just wish now. there was a hold up for a week. The episode a couple of years ago, it was next Saturday, and get a good lick in from in the morning. But touch wood, he might be better fresh.
Best of luck.
Thanks.
The huge shape of Alexander Banquet about to be led away from us. He's trained by Willie Mullins, who also has already saddled up Hedge Hunter. He's got an outstanding chance. He's so consistent, Hedge Hunter.
I think he is, and we've trained him especially for this race, and he's been fantastic since he came over. I've never seen him as cool. I hope that's a good sign going out to the parade ring. So I'm delighted the way everything has happened so far.
I think I'm right in saying he's finished in the first four in 17 of his 19 starts. That's incredible.
He was a bit frustrating in the beginning. I think he finished a second 11 times before he won a race, but since he's got the habit of winning, he's getting better at it. Yeah.
Okay, well, lots of people will be backing him and supporting you. Good luck.
He's in good form. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Willie.
There is the current title holder of the Martel Cognac Grand National. It is Monty's Pass. He won it last year for Barry Geraghty and his great trainer Jimmy Mangan. Such a famous victory for such a small-scale trainer, really, compared to the likes of Martin Pipe or Paul Nicholls. He does look tremendously well, Richard, but he's got a lot more weight this year.
He certainly has, but the ground's in his favour. Barry Geraghty having his fifth ride in the race, it's so exciting for them. But just looking at the horse, he's very well. You can see he's chewing on that bit, he's putting his head down. All the signs are, when you look at that horse, he's fit to run for him, you know, for the spoils. But a lot of weight.
No horse has retained his Grand National title since Red Rum in 74.
No, are there but to be it is a very open race, you know, and I just think, you know, that this horse won so easy last time, jumped so well. He's jumped around here twice, hasn't he? And he loves this course, and although the 14-pike hike he's got is a lot, I did feel he probably won a little bit comfortable last year. Mm.
The tension will be building there in the parade ring. Owners have been planning, thinking about this day all season, and now suddenly it's upon them.
Yes, and all they want is to get the jockeys out there. Now, what about Bounce Back? Now, weren't you fancying this, Lydia, earlier on?
I do quite fancy this one. The recent rain, we wouldn't have wanted that, really. You want it quite fast ground, I'd have thought. If you look at his form, he's best when his race is over fast ground. He's won a Whitbread Gold Cup. It was called the At the Races Gold Cup in the year that he won it. He then came back and ran well in it again last year. He's a big price. Your concern, Skew, though, is his size.
Yes, his size and his jumping. I'm ridden small horses around here like Bonanza Boy, and if you go back in the history books, I think Battleship was a tiny horse that went round. You know, he does occasionally jump his fences like a little horse.
I saw Andrew Thornton running the other day up a really steep hill out of Lambourne. He does it every day to keep his weight down. Well, of course, Tony Dobbin is a man who knows what it's like to have victory, and he's with Richie.
Yeah, I've got Tony Dobbin with me here. Tony, of course, who's won the Grand National before with Lord Gillene, and also Richie McGrath, who's hasn't won it yet, but you never know. Today could be the day you'll spot the difference. Tony, first of all, how are the nerves holding up before the race?
Yeah, it's quite exciting, isn't it? It's a good crack. It's lovely to be a part of it all, you know. So,
does it get easier?
Oh, no, it's the same every year. I mean, there's only one Aintree, and to be honest, it's probably the first real chance I've had since I won it a few years ago, you know, so I'm quite excited about it.
Have you ridden Gunnerwell but at home?
I have. I sat him a couple of Saturdays ago. He feeds on great farm, and Andrew said he's fine.
Okay, well, good luck. Quick word, Richie, about Spot the Difference, and how are you handling the pre-race tension?
Oh, just looking forward to it. Best race of the year, just see how we get on, you know. Mr. Bulger says he's in good order, and we'll just do our best.
Okay, what did the stewards tell you in the room beforehand?
Just how to bypass fences and what the recall flags are.
That's Timmy Murphy behind, making fun of everyone. There's going to be some trouble in here. We better go back and join Claire.
I don't know whether Rishi makes the trouble, but he certainly always finds it. Behind me, the Monty's Pass team, that's Katie. She's the lucky mascot. She was here last year. She's here again in the colours of Monty's Pass. And if we just run across here, the very interesting owner in this race, Terry Ramsden, has earned and lost more millions than any of us would ever get our hands on. He's made them back again now. He has a runner in the Grand National, Royal Atalza.
Hello.
Are you all right?
I'm really, really well, thank you.
Now, am I right in thinking you've backed this horse to win £2 million? Yeah, is it as much as that?
Whatever, thereabouts.
Seriously?
Mm.
And did I also hear that if he happens to win, what are you going to do with the prize money?
Well, here's the deal. Whatever happens, I will give £9,000 to the charity of someone's choice for the children of Liverpool, even if he doesn't finish, and I really hope he does. Any prize money, whether it's first, second, third, or fourth, or fifth, or sixth, I'll give away to the children of Liverpool. And if I win, I'll probably make a discretionary donation of some significance.
Well, we wish you all the luck.
For the children in Liverpool and everybody else, just hope he runs well. They'll get £9,000. Someone had better be telling me a good charity to do with it.
And if he wins, I suspect you will take off somewhere into the stratosphere.
I suspect it'll be the biggest bum fight you've ever seen. But there you go. Making another £300 million was easy in comparison to winning the race. We shall see.
That's true.
Thanks okay. a lot.
Thanks, Terry. Just a quick word with Norman Williamson, who's been looking at these horses that have been going around the paddock behind us, and a few getting a bit uptight.
Yes, Lacuja, really the main one. Very, very warm, and a good bit of time before the race. You know, you'd have to worry about him. The French horse Kalami, I thought, looks an absolute picture. But interesting to come here and see him. Someone just getting a little bit hyper. Monty's in good form.
Yeah, Monty's past looking well. Let's see what the paddock experts think.
And back in the changing room, the boys have got their hats tied skew. And this is something that didn't happen in your and my day, a team photograph.
No, I would think the jockeys could do without all this sort of thing. I suppose it's the same for rugby players and football players before internationals. You just really just want to get on with the action now, don't you? You know, you're trying to be relaxed and funny, but it's very difficult.
They've got to know that they're also part of showbiz. They've got to, you know, okay, it's go. You're screwed up for it, fine, but you've got to do your bit. Now, and that just leads me on. Martel have actually won the sponsorship of the decade for their sponsorship here at Aintree, and they beat off a lot of people like Floral, London Marathon, and lots of others. But this, I think, is a good thing. You probably don't, but the horses are the main players we want to have a look at this stage in proceedings. Of course, we've got several horses carrying numbers that where they've been brought in as reserves, so things will not be quite as they see when you see 20 Bramblehill Duke only carrying 10 stone. Here is Le Coudre. Now, Le Coudre is a big, strong horse. He's passed us several times here, Lydia, and he's really caught my eye. He is a classy horse.
Yeah, but he is sweating up, as Norman said, and that would be a little bit of a concern. He is a high-class horse, definitely over fences, but I would be worried, A, about the weight that he has to carry, 11 stone 12, and B, about his stamina. He hasn't won over 3 miles. He was second in a stayer's hurdle, suggests he does have some stamina, but I still have my doubts about him at this trip.
Yeah, I remember John Frankham going across to ride him for a piece before Cheltenham. Yeah, they're coming out and saying what a good horse Lucrudi was. There is Timmy Murphy coming out. I say there's
Jimmy McCarthy. Carl with no helmet. Hopefully he'll put it on.
There's last year's winner.
Alexander Banquet's colours. Paul Maloney. He's a Chocolate Thornton. He rides Bear on board. Ollie McPhail. They're all being a little bit nervous, these jockeys
Thierry
now.
Dumen, there's Thierry Dumen.
Can get those colours mixed up. Andrew Tinkler, my son Thomas. Joe Tizard, all coming through. Mick Fitzgerald, he's
Colonel Welburn's.
There's Graham Lee.
Amberleigh House.
Shaver Stewart.
And so many of JP's. He's got four.
That's right. Andrew Thornton on Smile in his house. There's some of Tony McCoy, some of, that's JP Mc. Magnus Quirk College, and get those easily mixed up.
Coming through.
Le Coudre, well, you're one of the oldest going out.
Oh, thanks very much.
A nice stroll with you. Are you looking forward to it?
I am, yeah. It's a horse with a lot of class and he should travel well and jump well, so hope for the best.
And the bad news is you haven't seen him yet, but he is sweating quite a lot.
He always does that.
Does he?
He does, he always does.
Wouldn't worry
about that, no, no.
Right, the best of luck, Conor.
Thanks very much.
Sorry, Dana, in the paddock, it's all getting a bit hectic, as you can imagine, with 39 runners. Martin Todhunter over here has got two runners in the race, King's Mark, who's finished fourth in it before now, and Justin Dett, who I think could be a very interesting outsider. What do you think?
Well, he's in good order, but it's a big ask, obviously. I mean, we haven't had him so long, but we're very happy with him at home. The rain, sadly, kept away for him, so...
Well, we had a big shower, though, earlier on, and I actually think you were thankful for that for Kingsmark.
Well, that's right. He wants all the rain he can get, so... But it's enabling him to run, so we're happy with the Grand Prix.
So they want two different extremes. Justin Dett wants it fast, and Kingsmark wants it softer. Jockeys are trying to find their various connections. And over here, this is Sky Cab's trainer, Nick Gifford. Now, his father, Josh, who's just here around the back, won the Grand National, which I'm sure many people remember, with Alderneaty in 1981. So, Josh, can I just grab a word with you? Nick took over from you last year. He's doing a great job, isn't he?
He's doing a great job, like your brother. You know, and I hope, you know, your brother won the classic, didn't he?
Yeah.
First season trainer.
Yeah.
So Nick's going to do it today.
With Skycab, the horse that you trained, he was your last winner as a trainer?
He was. And, you know, and I mean, it can go that way. There's always fairy tales to this race. Great race, isn't it?
Oh, it's a wonderful race.
And there's always a fairy story, and it's going to be today. Well, follow your brother, winning a classic. in his first season.
The trouble is my brother's in the race as well, trying to beat you.
No, well, I'm afraid he's going to be second. I'd love him to be second. I'd love him to be second.
Second to Skycat. Thanks,
that's
Josh.
Right.
Good
pleasure.
Luck.
Well, someone who won't be winning today is Ruby Walsh, who sadly picked up an injury yesterday. Ruby, just tell us a little bit about your wrist quickly.
Yeah, broke it yesterday in the novice chase. Medically, it's an undisplaced fracture of the ulna, I think is what they called it, but a few weeks in the sidelines anyway.
Okay, Ruby, I know this may sound a silly question, but how do you feel not being able to ride in the Grand National today?
I'm very, very disappointed. I mean, it's all about races like the National and Cheltenham and that, and it's just very, very disappointed.
And you would have ridden Exeter Wave. Does he have a chance of winning the race?
He's a great bet at 66-1. He looks an absolute picture. I watched him walking into the ring. He's small, but he's tough and gutsy, and he's a great bet at 66-1 each way.
Okay, Ruby, well, thanks for talking to us, and hopefully you'll still enjoy the race.
I don't know. Thanks.
Jos Naylor is now the favourite for the Martel Cognac Grand National at 10-1, with Jurison out to 11s. Hedge Hunter has been supported from 12s into 11s. David's Lad, Binderee, Clan Royal, all on 12-1. Bear on Board, a popular choice for so many, at 14s. Amberleigh House at 16s and Shardam at 18s. It's 20-1 bar, but Jos Naylor is the new favourite.
Well, for those of you watching the football earlier on, you'll recognise this face. Kenny Dalglish is here in the paddock. You used to come down here as a player, didn't you?
Yes, used to play in the morning and then come down in the afternoon, normally after we'd won.
Exactly, had a good winning record. Now, what do you fancy in the race this year?
Well, I don't honestly have a clue about horse racing. Amberleigh House and Calamity, and that's as far as I go. But the last time I said that, Clan Royal won. So it's just a great occasion. I'm just here for the social side of it, and I'm going to lose money, so at least I'm going to enjoy myself.
Well, best of luck to you. Amberleigh House, of course, finished third in the race last year, and Calamity was one of the last horses that ran in the colours of the Queen Mother over fences, has since been bought by John Halewood, so they'll both be running in the Halewood colours.
I have to point out that the last time I spoke to Kenny Dalglish, he also said that he knew nothing about horse racing. That was before the race, and then after the race, he revealed that he actually had the winning ticket.
Yes, but his wife only gave him a fiver to go racing with in November and said, bring some change back, so he didn't win a lot of money, I can assure you. Jurison, well, Tony McCoy has boiled his body down to ride at 10 stone 7, and for those of you at home who are not horsey people, that means not just his body weight but the saddle, if you can call it a saddle, that he's sitting on, just be something just to hang some stirrups on.
Yes, he, as I say, I went down and rode him. He's a lovely horse. I think he's got everything that a national horse should be. He stays, he jumps, and I know that Tony is really looking forward to riding him.
Tony McCoy's ridden the favourite in this race many times before, but this is really his biggest chance, I think.
He is so bullish. Now, Tony has been, unusually for him, you know, been very public about the chances that this horse has.
Yeah, but for once, he's on a horse that likes all the conditions. He's got everything going for him. This horse has got a big chance.
Stamina is so important. That's maybe a silly thing to say, Scoo, but very few will actually see 4.5 miles out. There's Liam Cooper and Clan Royal coming out.
There's Royal Atalza. Terry Ramsden, you heard, he's going to donate some money to charity no matter what happens, but the more he wins, the more he donates.
And Thomas, here's your boy.
Yeah, it's my boy going through. There's Claire's boy, Gunnar Wellborn. There's Graham Lee on Amberleigh House, who's coming through. And there's another one of JP's coming through. That's Le Coudre, just going through there.
Tell you what, this FA Cup semi-final Grand National double bill is working out rather well, from Kenny Dalglish to Emlyn Hughes. Emlyn has a runner in the race, Mantle's Prince. He's a big price, but...
He's a big price, man. Yeah, he is. But he's jumped the fences. He got around the 25th fence last year, and he unseated Ollie McPhail. So we know he can jump fences, and you never know with the Grand National. There might only be three left in the race after five fences.
It does happen.
So you never know what's going to happen. So fingers crossed, we hope it gets round safe, and we hope it comes back safe.
And talking of safe, a lot of people have been very concerned about you, sending you best wishes. You haven't been well, but how are you now?
Claire, I'm superb. Honestly, seriously, the last three reports from the doctor have been brilliant. They've been absolutely tremendous. And fingers crossed, there's a hell of a lot worse off than I am, darling.
Well, you'll feel even better if Mantle's Prince runs a big race.
Not much, darling. I'll come looking for you.
Good luck, Emma.
I'll give you a kiss on telly.
Yes, great character, isn't he? Now, let's just watch them coming out, Skew. This is the time where this is Tony McCoy. There's Martin Pipe on the left.
Yes, obviously this is the number one contender from the Pipe Stable, as I say. I just think he has all the attributes to go well. There is another one of the great chances is Josh Nailey. He's now favourite, as we know, ridden by the great national expertise in Paul Carberry.
Can I just tell you something? The girl leading up, Michelle Nuttall, actually runs round the gallops behind this horse because it relaxes him. She has long reins on and drives him around the gallops. Well, she'll be as fit as Joss Naylor.
If not fitter, I'd have thought. That sounds like all the hard work from her has brought this national horse have a favourite's chance, the public thinks.
I suppose the one thing about him is that he hasn't run for a long time, has it? Is that against him?
Well, on the statistics, that's against him. All 19 of the last winners did have a run within the last 6 weeks, but it seems to be a definite policy of John Joe O'Neill's because his other runner, Clan Royal, also hadn't run since November, so it's obviously a decision rather than a setback.
Yeah,
I guess.
Think it's the right thing.
He's been declared several times, hasn't he, in big races through the winter, and then hasn't made it.
Yes, I suppose he was due to run in the Welsh National, wasn't he? Yeah. So that was at the end of December.
Yeah. Well, Paul Carberry, we're talking about riding lengths of stirrup. You can see where his knee bends, which is almost above the withers of the horse. And it's quite short skew, is that advantage, disadvantage?
One of the greatest artists in the saddle, Paul Carberry. His father, Tommy Carberry, won the National as well. They're all milling around, they'll just be getting into odds and even numbers, so Lydia and Richard be able to go through the parade in a minute, but it's a nerve-wracking time. There's one of the jockeys just dismounting the horse there. That could be Lacoudre because he's got so much weight, I suspect. No, that's Monty's pass, but he's got a lot of weight, so
now,
Barry
what sort of advantage is that skew, then?
Well, it helps. If he wins a short head, that little bit of energy could have made the difference. You do everything you can to sway the thing in your favour.
Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthem will now be sung by Simone Sofenor, Elaine Holden, Brendan McBride and John von Nuding. Welcome to the 2004 Martel Cognac Grand National.
Jocks want to do is to be let loose, get down to the start and get on with it. The parade is such a good one. Let's kick on.
There is number one, Lacoudre, the Mount of Conroe rides his ninth ride in the race, but his best was his first when he rode Laura's Bow to finish third in 1992. Chrissy Roche is the trainer. This is his second runner in the race.
Let's move on to Monty's Pass, last year's winner. He's got 11-10. Barry Garrity's fifth ride in the race. He is not out of it. He's back in with a big shout.
Richard Johnson on What's Up, boys. They were second to Bindery in agonising circumstances in 2002. He's had a leg injury since. Does he retain his class?
Shea Barry will be on Alexander Banquet for Willie Mullins. His Mikko's Dream was favourite a few years ago. Fell at the first fence. Wish him luck.
Mick Fitzgerald is on Kingsmark. Number five, and this horse would like a softer ground. He also has battled back from injury, but Mick Fitzgerald has won this race memorably, of course, in 96 with Rough Quest.
We'll drop back to Arctic Jack, one of four runners for Trevor Hemmings. Dominic Ellsworth rides his second ride in the race here, and he got round on his first ride.
Stablemate of the one horse Lacoudre is number seven, Risk Accessor. It's going to be a hair-raising ride, I think, for Seamus Durack. This horse does tend to clout the odd one. He could end up on the deck.
And the former Irish Grand National winner is David Slab there with a big, big sheepskin noseband on there. Timmy Murphy rides his eighth attempt at this race. He's been second once.
Vindery is number 9. He won this race in 2002, but that man on board today wasn't on board then. Carl Llewellyn is back on board, though. He won it in 98 with Earth Summit, and this horse is in better form.
Behind him, Al Capone from Ireland, Miles Morris's stable. This horse can stay. He's got indifferent form, and he's ridden by Noel Feeney.
Number 11 is Punter, one of 7 horses from Martin Pipe's yard running here. Danny Howard is on board. This horse is still a novice, and he's got stamina to prove as well.
Joe Tizard collected the ride for Henrietta Knight on Southern Star. We'll get here Trevor Hemming's colours again. This horse can belt the odd fence, but he's okay most of the time.
Also owned by Trevor Hemmings, like Southern Star, is Hedge Hunter. This horse is the mount of David Casey. It's his 6th ride in the race.
Tom Scudamore rides Chardam. He's had a saddle slip, a bridle, a blinkers go over the horse's eyes, but he got round last year.
Takachi is number 15, trained by Edward O'Grady. Davey Russell on board. He'd probably prefer softer ground, though.
Joss Naylor, the new favourite. He's not over big, but he is a lovely horse here. Carberry's 9th ride. He's competed 4 times.
Number 17, Amberleigh House, is almost as much an Aintree standing dish as his trainer, Ginger McCain. Graham Lee was 3rd on this horse last year. Can he do better?
And the Bunny Boiler has already won the Midlands Grand National. He's ridden by Barry Gerrits' elder brother, Ross. 2 brothers in the race.
Number 19 is a non-runner. That's Tyne and Tyne again. But that's number 21, Gunnar Wellbourne. 4th in this race last year. Tony Dobbin on board. Andrew Balding is the trainer, a horse that's got form around these fences.
And Kalami for Francois Duman was bought over breakfast. Judy Eaton calls Francois Duman Mr. Cornflakes. And she's Miss Crunchy.
The champion jockey seeking his first win in the race is Tony McCoy. He's on board Gironcon, the best fancied of Martin Pipe 7. He jumps, he stays, he'll like this ground.
Another grey, there are 3 in the race, Royal Atalza. Well, this one ran abysmally when we saw it over fences, but won on the all-weather on the flat afterwards.
Jim Colotti is on Justin Debt, number 25. Was due to ride Big Irish Hope Tim Bearer, but got on this one late. He'll like this ground. He was 3rd in the Kerry National. Could be an outsider to follow.
An exit away from Paul Nichols' yard. Bobby McNally just got the call when Ruby Walsh got hurt. It's sometimes not a bad thing to have not too much warning.
Clan Royal is unbeaten over these fences. He won the Beach Chase and he won the Topham, but no winner of either of those races has gone on to win the big one.
Acheris from the Pipe Stable is owned by the White family, famous for making cider down in the Taunton country. They'll be drinking something stronger if this wins.
Another runner owned by JP McManus, this time with the red distinguishing cap. Richard McGraw is on board Spot the Difference. This is his 3rd ride in the National and he hasn't completed yet.
Bounce Back seems to have lost his form. We haven't seen a great deal from him and he doesn't run all that often. He'll certainly be fresh at 50-1 with Lenzio Thornton on board.
Ardent Scout, number 31, went over a short course of these fences in 2002. The Beecher Chase, Warren Marston rides this Sue Smith-trained runner.
And Robert Thornton having his 8th ride on Bear on board. This is the one that comes out on top on Linear Statistics and Rules.
Lord Atterbury is having a first run for Martin Pipe. Was trained before by son and assistant David. Mark Bradman's on board and looking for his first completion.
Ollie McPhail rides Mantle's Prince for Emily Hughes and the Clovery Golfers. His 3rd ride, the horse is visored for the first time. Not something I go for.
Horse number 35 is Blowing Wind. 3rd in 2001, 3rd in 2002 and 8th last year. Jimmy McCarthy's on board. He might well get round again.
Pat Betts owns Sky Cab, Nick Gifford trains. Well, Josh was quite emotional beforehand. He could be very emotional afterwards.
Wonder Weasel is the mount of JP Manara, who's putting up £6 overweight. This horse has fallen both times over these fences.
Andrew Tinkler rides his 1st ride in the race on Smarty. Lovely balanced horse, 2nd a couple of years ago. A big price.
Les Gadou is number 40. Currently looking at number 39, Smarty, heading down there. There is 40. Les Cadou. Brian Harding is on board. Questions about this one's stamina. He's also finished a long way behind when trying these fences before.
And we'll go on to another Pipe horse. He's got 7 in the race. And the next one we see is Montreal. He's only a 7-year-old. And here he is now. 7-year-olds don't have a good record in this race. And Joey Elliott having his 1st ride in the Martel Grand National.
And the last one we're going to see There he is in the black and gold crossboats. James Davis on board Bramble Hill Duke. He fell at the first in 2003. 19-year-old James Davis having his first ever ride. Those are the 39 horses heading for the Martel Grand National. The Davis beginning. Let's go back to Claire.
Well, I'm down here at the start. It's the most incredible atmosphere. A little bit of a worry for people who've backed Bear on board is that he just unseated Robert Thornton on the way down to have a look at the first fence. He spooked at something on the inside rail, jinked sideways, and Robert Thornton hit the deck. So before the race has even started, he's felt the force of a fall. What's up, boys, just behind me? I'll just turn you around, because have a look. All these runners just having last-minute preparations before the start. But look at the crowd all the way down the course. Look at that, just the most incredible atmosphere. And somewhere up there in the stands is John Parrott.
Yes, here with the connections of Bounce Back, Steve Runker representing them. Nervous?
Incredibly so, but not as nervous as John and Belinda Harvey, who stood in a betting shop in Bridgetown, Barbados, waiting for this to happen.
Well, they were certainly good judges to get the nice weather out there, but this horse has got a chance, hasn't it?
Well, if you go back 2 years when it won the Whitbread, I have to say, if it were to take to these fences, and no one knows whether it can jump these fences, but if it said, look, this is really good fun, it's got the form to do it, hasn't it?
There'd be worse horses 50 to 1 plus than this, wouldn't there?
I guess there are, yeah, but this is what dreams are made of. Have a runner in the National, John and Belinda are out there thinking, had a big party last night and rang Martin Pipe at 4:30 this morning. He didn't answer the phone and said, what chance have we got? But they're as nervous as kittens.
Good luck, Steve.
Thanks very much, John.
Every year close to the off, the bookmakers shorten the fancied horses in the National, and it's happening again. Joss Naylor, Durancon and Binderee are all 10-1, with Hedge Hunter and Clan Royal in a point from 12-1 into 11-1. There's also a big gamble going on Arctic Jack, and Spot the Difference is also being well backed as well. They're in the bigger prices, but at the moment we've got co-favourites of three, Joss Naylor, Durancon and Binderee at 10-1 in the National, with Hedge Hunter and Clan Royal at 11s.
And could we have five joint favourites very shortly? Here's Bear on board. Now, you've been following this horse, all his stats go for it. He certainly looks a typical chaser, doesn't he?
Yeah, we've looked at the statistical evidence of this race. This race responds particularly well to that kind of analysis, and this was the one that came out of all 40. He'll definitely stay. My one concern was that rain came a little bit too late for him. He might get outpaced at a critical time.
Yeah, I think that you go back to a horse like Mr. Frisk on this type of ground, being able to go right gallop and keep going. And Jurison will try and do that, and any of the slower horses could just be find difficulty laying up early on, don't you think, Norman?
Yes, Peter, I totally agree. Going back to that Mr. Friskier, they went absolutely flat out, and horses like Bear on board will just struggle, especially down to Beecher's first time. That's really when you need the pace. It's not late on in the race, they don't quicken up much.
I could see Le Coudre's owner, Conor O'Dwyer, is not on the horse's back. He's obviously saving him. He's got top handicap weight of 11 stone 12, and we mentioned earlier on that Monty's Pass, Barry Geraghty was doing it, but you can see there's several jockeys off now.
Yeah, I wonder if there is some sort of delay, whether that's why they're off. Anyway, look at the huge crowd there. Absolutely, the real atmosphere has been captured by this crowd again. There's Josh Gifford having a chat to Mick Fitzgerald and to Timmy Murphy. We're already 5 minutes late off of the race. I'm not sure what the hold-up is, but as you say, the jockeys themselves are in no hurry. There is Smarty coming towards us, but all the jockeys will be having a little bit of a chat now and just hoping for the race to get on.
Well, hopefully the start not far away. It's time to join our commentary team. And first, Ian Bartlett, he will be taking us through the first few fences. As they head out into the country, watching from Beecher's, Tony O'Hare. And also out into the country, joining our team for the first time, Darren Owen. Somewhere there. And high above the grandstand, our lead race commentator, Jim McGrath. Jim, it's all yours.
Thank you, Sue. Yes, the runners are circling at the start now for this, the 157th running of the Grand National, sponsored for the final time by Martel Cognac. And so far we're running something like 4 or 5 minutes late, but the horses all well behaved, with the one exception, as Claire was telling you before, of Bear on board, who unshipped Robert Thornton. Just going down to have a look at the first. Now, jockeys are being told to remount. There's David's lad, Timmy Murphy, getting back in the saddle. He looked like he was going like a winner 2 years ago when he fell. Wasn't allowed to run last year. There is the starter, Simon Morant. And let's have a look at the betting. The last show from Angus.
Well, Joss Naylor, Duran Con, Bindery are the 10-1 co-favourites for the National. Hedge Hunter and Clan Royal are 11-1. David's Lad is 12-1. Bear on Board is 14-1. Amberleigh House is 16-1. Shardam is 18-1. It's 20-1 bar. It looks like we're going to have co-favourites in the National. Joss Naylor, Duran Con and Bindery at the moment.
Well, no surprise to see that, because this has been spoken of as the most open Grand National for many, many years. Any number of chances. And at one stage in the anti-post betting this week, we did see 18. We did see 18 of the runners at 50-1 or over. Now, Smarty's being reshod. Smarty, who was second in this race a few years back, a first ride for Andrew Tinkler, 18-year-old. He's the youngest rider in the race. It's not being reshod, it's just a part of the tack there. It looks like a surcingle that's being replaced. Smarty, trained by Mark Pittman, and Andrew Tinkler having his first ride. You can imagine how nervous he's feeling. And there the horses are coming forward now towards the tapes. The 39 of them, the non-runner is number 19, Tyne and Tyne again. There's Monty's Pass, last year's winner, in the foreground. He bids to become the first since Red Rum to win back-to-back Grand Nationals. There's Smarty. This is his third attempt at a Grand National, just beaten by a Red Marauder in appalling conditions. But conditions today are generally good. We had quite a deal of rain, about a 20-minute burst earlier in the afternoon, but not enough to really affect the ground. Officially, it is good, and runners are circling down at the start. The oldest jockey in the field is Carl Llewellyn, who's riding Bindery. It will be his 13th ride in the big race, and Bindery, of course, the winner in 2002. There's Simon Moran, the starter, walking over. Shardam in the foreground, Tom Scudamore having his fourth ride. Bear on Board, Chocolate Thornton. Number 12 is Southern Star. 33 is Lord Atterbury. Mark Bradburn having his third ride in the big race. On his far side is Kalami. There is Spot the Difference, Richie McGrath riding in his third National. Mantle's Prince on the near side. There's Monty's Past. Can he win a second Grand National? Jimmy Mangan, his trainer, reckons he might be the next Red Rum. He certainly hasn't set the fields alight since his last win, but he has been prepared for only one race, and this is it. Now, this is the reason for the delay. Smarty just being, they look like they've either replaced the girth or the surcingle, and that's the surcingle just going on the outside there of that girth strap, and essential to keep the saddle. Now, Claire's actually down there. Claire, what are you seeing at the moment?
Well, Smarty's been getting really fractious, Jim, and actually, finally, things have been sorted out and mended there, but the stirrup was lost, and Smarty was getting himself in a right state as the stirrup had to be put back on, and he was virtually resaddled again. But it looks now like he's ready to go. The crowd is certainly getting excited about it.
Well, that's the sort of tension that most jockeys and horses connections of horses with a runner in the Grand National don't want. There's Chocolate Thornton on Bear on Board. What a fairy story to be if this horse could win. He's one of the biggest improvers in the jumping ranks this season. There they are circling, 39 of them. They'll have a real charge to the first turn. They run over the Malling Road and out into the country. There's Alexander Banquet on the near side for Ireland. Shea Barry having his second ride. Last time he had a ride in the race, he was on a horse called Moondigwa and was sent into orbit at the chair. What a memorable picture that was in the Sunday papers. There hasn't been a grey win this race for 43 years. Nicholas Silver was the last, and this year we see three of them. But now the starter is calling them in. He's going over to mount the rostrum. They come up to the tapes now. It won't be long before the 39 runners are dispatched for this, the 157th running of the Martel Cognac Grand National. Coming into line, Smarty, wrist accessor is back behind them, David's Lad standing well back. It's essential that you get a good position. Very, very hard to come from way, way off the pace. It has been done, of course. This race, the world's biggest steeplechase, the most demanding there is. 30 fences ahead of them, 4.5 miles. Alexander Bagwood down near the inside from Hedge Hunter, his stablemate. They're up there early from Monty's Pass, and further back in the field then is Wonder Weasel from Josh Naylor. Back in the field too is Puntel in the early stages from Bounce Back. Out wider then is Al Capone as they go over the rally road, and we join Ian Bartlett.
So down to the first of the 30 fences, Acherus is up there with Luz Kadu and Alexander Banquet, and at the first fence Arctic Jack is a faller. Kalami was brought down by the fall of Luz Kadu at the tail of the field as well, and so it's three of them, Arctic Jack, Luz Kadu and Kalami, down at the first as they come over fence number two. Now the open ditch number three, Alexander Banquet, Gullab Elburn, Puntel from Al Capone, then comes Edge Hunter, Montes Pass, Bounce Back and Agarus as they come over it from Justin Dead. We lose one there, Shardam is down, unseats the rider, and he's the only one to go at fence number three as they quickly come down to the fourth with Alexander Banquet on the inside with Bounce Back, Edge Hunter at the centre, and Al Capone, the first couple of leaders over that blowing wind of Bramble Hill Duke behind those as we join Tony O'Hare.
They're racing down now towards the fence before Beaches, and in the centre Al Capone, right there towards the inside, Hedge Hunter and Gunnar Wellburn, and behind these is Alexander Banquet. Bramble Hill Duke is out wide, Puntal is also handy with Acherus, and also we can also say that Jurison was a faller a couple of fences back as they come to jump Beaches now, and the leaders Hedge Hunter. And on the inside there, we've lost a Bounce Back at that one. Also gone is Acherus, Sky Cab is down. And also down is What's Up Boys, Blowing Wind Refused, as they go to the Foynaven fence. And Hedge Hunter and Al Capone are the two leaders, followed by Gunnar Wellburn in third. Lord Atterbury is next, and behind these is Puntal. Alexander Banker on the inside, and behind these is Monty's Pass, who's followed by Wonder Weasel and Smarty and Justin Depp. And then Southern Star as they reach the canal turn. Al Capone on the inside, bad mistake, Alexander Banquet, but survived it, and they're all safely over the leaders. Exit to Wavers at the back of the field. Pindari is also out of the race as they clear the next fence. The leaders are Hedge Hunter and alongside Al Capone as we join Darren Owen.
Approaching the 10th exit to Wave, pulled up before Valentine's, it's Al Capone and Hedge Hunter. They're disputing the lead as they jump this plain fence. Puntal is just in behind them, followed by Gunnar Wellburn. Then to the outside comes Lord Atterbury, further back to Monty's Pass. Alexander Banquet is against the rail. Bear on board is to the outside. This is a big open ditch. The rat Hedge Hunter flew the ditch by a length and a half, followed by Al Capone back in second place. Back in the field, there's a bad mistake there from Wonder Weasel looking to the rear. Plum last at the moment is the Bunny Boiler. They're going on towards the next, and it's Hedge Hunter by a couple of lengths. Al Capone brushed through the top of that one. Puntal is well to the fore. Lord Atterbury further back then to Gunnar Wellburn, already being driven along. Alexander Banquet, then last year's winner Monty's Pass, who's being followed by Bear on board. Justin Dead Smart is next. Clan Royal is still in the race, so too is Lecouvre. They're back on the race course proper. Over to Jim McGrath.
Well, the leaders here for Ireland is Hedge Hunter from Puntel, and just behind them is Al Capone, who's been making a lot of the running. In fourth position, Lord Atterbury, the outside, then the riderless horse, followed by Gunnar Wellburn and Alexander Banquet, who's been prominent throughout. Monty's Pass, last year's winner, is jumping well, and he's in about sixth or seventh position. The white sleeves and cap, a gap to Bear on board, followed then by Clan Royal as they come up towards this next plain fence now, and as they draw towards it now, and the riderless horse as they go over the 13th there is causing a little bit of problems, and it's Hedge Hunter on the far side who shows the way. Hedge Hunter, the Willie Mellons Train Chaser, is the leader as they come to the 14th from Puntel. Then in third is Lord Atterbury. Jumping at fourth is Al Capone, followed by Gunnar Welburn and Alexander Banquet from Mondy's Pass. They're all over it safely. Further back is Clan Royal. They're followed by Bear on Board and Takagi and Star Smarty from Just in Death. A gap in the field of Amberleigh House as they come to the chair. And Hedge Hunter headed over in the lead there from Puntel. Jumping it in third, Lord Atterbury. Going there is Takagi, a faller at the chair. And all the others got over it well as they come to the water. The leader is Hedge Hunter, clear of Puntel. Lord Atterbury jumping in third, Al Capone in fourth. Followed by Clan Royal and Gunnar Welburn. Then Monty's Pass is handy. Alexander Banquet the inside, four or five lengths. Then the Bear on Board, followed by Smarty. Amberleigh House is next. Mantle's Prince has been pulled up. Lacoutre is next, followed then in the field by Wonder Weasel. Then out wider Royal tells it, Just in Debt from Ireland Scout, David's Lad, then King's Mark. Back in the field, Southern Star, followed then by the Bunny Boiler. Spot the Difference is next. Joss Naylor's at long last, and 22 of them are still continuing as we rejoin Ian Bartlett.
And they head down to fence number 17. Hedge Hunter stood out there with a green cap in front. The white jacket of Puntel in second, and then comes Lord Atterbury, blue cap in third. Clan Royal, Liam Cooper getting him a lot closer. He's stalking through this field into fourth nay. Then Alexander Banquet on the inside. Monty's Pass and Bear on Board in the yellow jacket. Behind this is Al Capone as they come to this next plain fence. And then comes the Coudre and Amberleigh House. And Alexander Banquet is a faller there as they head down towards the ditch again. Hedge Hunter leading. Puntel second. Then Clan Royal's now into third as they come over from Lord Atterbury. Puntel has gone there. Monty's Pass is over and okay. Le Coudre clears it okay. Wonder Weasel, a terrible mistake. King's Mark, David's that at the back. The Bunny Boiler well back amongst them with Rizkak, Cesar and Joss Naylor still on his way to it now as the leaders have cleared the other ones. And Joss Naylor has been pulled up before the 19th. We rejoin Tony O'Hare.
Coming to the fence before Beaches, Hedge Hunter leads from Clan Royal in second. Then Lord Atterbury in third place. Pulled up is Gunnar Welburn. A gap then to last year's winner, Monty's Pass. Then comes Bear on Board. Behind him, Al Capone, then Amberleigh House. And after Amberleigh House, Le Coudre. And a gap to Royal Atalza as they come to Beaches, where among the fallers on the first circuit, we also lost Risk Accessor in Montreal as they clear that one. And it's Hedge Hunter, the leader over Beaches. Clan Royal's rider, Liam Cooper, stealing a peep over his shoulder as they go over that. And the Coudre's out of it at Beaches. The Bunny Boiler's a long way behind. They come to the point, Avon Fence, and Hedge Hunter jumps to the head of Clan Royal. Lord Atterbury close in third. About 8 lengths back to Bear on Board. 4 Monty's Pass, 5 Amberleigh House, 6. 12 lengths to Al Capone. Then comes Royal Atalza. We've lost Justin Depp at the Foynaven. Smarty still in the race, so too David's Leather at the canal turn. Hedge Hunter from Clan Royal, Lord Atterbury. Slight mistake there, clear from Monty's Pass, who lands fourth on the inside of Bear on Board. Amberleigh House next, clear of Al Capone as they go out over Valentine's. Hedge Hunter the leader with Clan Royal and Lord Atterbury clear of Monty's Pass as we rejoin Darren Owen.
They've got 5 to jump, and it's Hedge Hunter being pressed by Clan Royal to the inside. Lord Atterbury's running a big race to the outside. Clan Royal made a mistake, so did Lord Atterbury. Looking behind Amberleigh House, Sheepskin Noseband is getting into contention. Bear on Board and Monty's Pass are being driven along. Al Capone is out of the race. That one pulled up. This is the last ditch four from home. It's Hedge Hunter and Clan Royal together. And then a break of about 2 lengths to Lord Atterbury. They're clear of Amberleigh House, Monty's Pass, Bear on Board, and then further back to Smarty, David's Lad and Wonder Weasel. This is the third last in the National, and it's Hedge Hunter from Clan Royal. Lord Atterbury's in behind them, and then after this one, Amberleigh House, as they go on towards the Melling Road. They're looking further back, Wonder Weasel's been pulled up. They thunder across the Melling Road. They've got 2 fences to jump, and it's Hedge Hunter being pressed by Clan Royal. Lord Atterbury holds every chance. Over to Jim McGrath.
Well, 3 major chances in the 150th, 7th running of this Martel Cognac Grand National. Hedge Hunter for Ireland on the near side, grabbed now by Clan Royal in the colours of J.P. McManus, who takes it up now. Then in third is Lord Atterbury, running a great race for Mark Bradburn, and they've kicked away a long way in front of Amberleigh House, continuing on, and Monty's Pass is a distant fifth. They've got 2 fences left to jump in the Martel Cognac Grand National. On the far side, under the whip, is Clan Royal, Lord Atterbury, Mark Bradburn is riding confidently in the centre. Hedge Hunter's on the left as they jump the second last. They all jump it well, clear of Amberleigh House. A long gap then to Monty's Pass. They've got 1 fence to jump in the Grand National. Clan Royal going up and down in the one spot. In the centre is Lord Atterbury. Near side is Hedge Hunter. They've got to jump. Like Clan Royal got over that one. Hedge Hunter's a faller at the last. Clan Royal in front by 2 or 3 lengths. Trying hard. Seventh is Art Scout in eighth position. Bear on board, then King's Mark from the Bunny Boiler, and David's Lad is the last of those to finish. Ginger McCain, Mr. Red Rum, has won his fourth Grand National. He has trained Amberleigh House to win the 2004 Martel Cognac Grand National in the hands of the very, very talented Graham Lee. The winner is number 17, Amberleigh House, owned by Hallowed International, trained by Ginger McCain and ridden by Graham Lee. Second is number 27, and that is Clan Royal, owned by J.P. McManus, trained by John Joe O'Neill, ridden by Liam Cooper. And third is number 33, Lord Atterbury, owned by D.A. Johnson, trained by Martin Pipe and ridden by Mark Bradman. What a ride he gave it as well. And fourth is number 2, Monty's Pass, owned by D. Racing Syndicate, trained by Jimmy Mangan and ridden by Barry Geraghty. Graham Lee has won the Grand National. And let's look for the trainer, Ginger McCain. There is Graham Lee. He cannot believe it. Amberleigh House has won it. This 28-year-old rider. Amberleigh House's third Grand National attempt. He'd run so well before. And he loves Aintree. And who would have thought after the magic years, the golden years of steeplechasing in the 70s, when Ginger McCain and Red Rum dominated the scene, who would have ever thought that the Southport trainer could come up with another to win this big race? 16-1, if you had it, what a price. Amberleigh House is the winner, Graham Lee, here he is coming back, and there is Ginger, being congratulated, and the winner has scored officially by 3 lengths, with 2 lengths between second and third. He always had faith in this horse, Ginger. He always said that this was the horse that could win him another Grand National. And he even at one stage begged with a handicapper to put him up in the weights because he wanted to make sure he got into the field.
Well, this is the most incredible story for Ginger McCain and also for Graham Lee, the winning jockey. You came from a mile back.
I didn't have a great run early with loose horses and one thing and another, and he got a fright real early. They got a real good gallop, thanks Davey, and I just never moved on him, and whenever he was ready to come, I'm overjoyed.
I should think it's more than just overjoyed. Congratulations from all the jockeys around you, everyone's so chuffed for you, but only your second ride in the National. You rode him last year, finished third. He's the perfect horse for it.
When he stops going around there, I ain't going to take any more rides in the race, I don't think, because it doesn't come any better than him.
And when you were young growing up, Graham, this had to be your dream when you were young. This had to be the thing you wanted to do.
I can't believe it's happened, David. I'm overjoyed. Thanks, Ted.
Absolutely wonderful. Well done, Graham. Well done, Amberleigh House.
Absolutely delighted, as indeed he should be, after Amberleigh House has won the 2004 Grand National. And was the race won and lost at the elbow? We'll see here, because Clan Royal, who was getting very, very tired on the far side, he was pretty well legless at that stage, and we might just have a look at them as they come to the elbow. But Liam Cooper, he almost found himself in no man's land on the far side, just before that actually. In the centre, Lord Atterbury, near side Amberleigh House, perfectly judged ride by Graham Lee, flying home on the near side to get up and win this famous race. Clan Royal, he was wandering, he was very, very weary before the elbow, and he has finished second. But there, the elation of a winner in Graham Lee, having only his second ride in the Grand National. And let's check the prices. Amberleigh House at 16-1 the winner. Clan Royal 10-1 co-favorite second. Lord Atterbury 40-1 third. What a race he ran. And fourth, Monty's Pass, and he was always going pretty well. He finished fourth at 20-1. It was only the weight that's actually caused him not to figure a lot closer. But he loved the fences again around here. Amberleigh House, I don't know whether he's loving that camera, but I'm sure it's all part of the the deal here. Hedge Hunter, who fell heavily at the last, is walking away, I'm pleased to say, accompanied by his partner David Casey. They show the way for until that second last, actually, when Clan Royal got through, and it was still in with a chance, still third when he fell, fell very heavily, but he's okay, he's walking away. Now this is the famous winner's enclosure at Aintree. Every jockey wants to visit this, and you know you have to have a combination of talent, brilliance, courage, and above all a bit of luck. That's what's required to win the Grand National. Amberleigh House has done it, owned by Hallowed International Limited, who purchased this horse as a possible winner of the Grand National. And Ginger McCain, the man who was associated with the greatest Aintree horse of them all, Red Rum, has trained the winner. 27 years it is since Red Rum's third and final Grand National win. There's Ginger. I can't wait for the interview because he is going to be so happy. Well, the scenes, emotional scenes down there in the winner's enclosure. As this very brave horse, it takes something to jump those fences and to stay that. The stamina required for 4.5 miles. That alone is quite exceptional. There's Ginger on the near side being congratulated again by Nigel Payne, who had a share in Earth Summit when that won the Grand National. But the story of the race was that it was
Ginger's here, he just said, I think I'm too old for that.
No, I thought, you know, a bit out, I thought, oh, did him, he's given him a lot to do, and he was creeping, and I thought, well, magic, we're going to be in the fourth. And it's not very sporting of me, I know. But I think when the three in front, I'm thinking, get down, one of you, because I'm not a sportsman. And then the old horse, Graham's come wide on the outside. He said he was going to hold him up this year, more than we did last year. And he was quite correct, but I never honestly thought I was ever going to win another national. I didn't, it was as simple as that, but I'd have been delighted, as I said to you, to finish the first six or eight. Well, he's a great little horse around here, isn't he? He really, really is.
He's so brave, isn't he, just looking?
In his foot perfect. He's a good sort of horse, he's a professional. You know, he's positive, he's exact, and he's the best thing that's happened to me for a long, long time.
Do you think you realise exactly what has happened? It hasn't sunk in yet?
Well, I'm not quite sure whether it, listen, winning it, I would never have done it without John. To be quite honest, John said, look, you're a dodging old bastard, and it's time
you won.
And it's time you won another national, and I shall be eternally grateful for him for giving me that opportunity. But to be fair, the credit for it goes to my son Donald, because he's lived the horse, rides him all his work and everything that goes with it. He really, really does. And to be truthful, I'm getting a bit too old, and I haven't the patience to do what we used to do. Credit's young Donald.
It'll win it one time more next year too, that horse. And actually, I live next to your neighbour. You're both richer than Bob Ayers.
How do you, in fact?
I do.
But what does this mean here?
You're a better tennis player than him, though.
Brilliant.
Absolutely. I thought so, coming 4 or 5 hours, I thought, wow, Graham could just keep going, because he's 12 years of age and he's great as the owner, so I thought we'd just keep going, and he did, didn't he? That's a heart of steel, isn't it? A lion, wasn't he?
Absolutely.
A lion, wasn't he?
Yeah.
I think probably the best Grand National winner I've ever seen, because he just came from so far back there, and always I saw him just picking the stride, keep going, and coming over 2 hours, I thought, no, you're a long way back now, kid.
He did it, didn't he?
What did you realistically think before the race? What were you hoping for?
No, I thought we'd win.
Really?
Yes. I thought Kellamy might. They went to the first, but next year, Ginger's got something to beat next year. Kellamy will go next year. He's learned his little lesson now, and he'll go, I don't care anymore. That's all right.
How did you get involved in racing? Was it through Ginger?
It's my father. We came down to the first, to walking in here in 19-something, Red Rum's last national, and we couldn't afford the prices. This is my mother, Eileen, Irish mother, English father, and we couldn't afford the prices, so we watched Red Rum when it was last national.
Yeah, all right.
To be the last fence. And my father said to me, one day you might be able to afford this. So I had two horses today and a box. And he's done me proud, hasn't he? So brilliant, wasn't it?
It was absolutely brilliant. Enjoy it. Enjoy
it. Thank you very much.
Okay.
My God.
Well, what an exciting finish. And two horses that ran great races. Clanroll in second and Monty's Pass in fourth. JP, so close.
Yeah, it was great. He ran his whole heart out there. You know, he ran a little bit free from Beechers or going down to Beechers, but Liam got a few great jumps out of him and, you know, I'm delighted.
You could come here back with him next year. I mean, look at Amberleigh House. He gets better every time he comes here.
Looks like it. You know, it's a great win for Ginger. Full marks him. You know, he seems to own this Liverpool. And his horse, he was the stronger at the finish. And, you know, you can't take anything away from him. He's very game.
No, it was a wonderful finish. And Monty's Pass, let's not forget, last year's winner managed to finish fourth. Jimmy, are you pleased with that?
Oh, delighted. Absolutely delighted. You know, I couldn't be more pleased. But he had a big weight and, you know, he was bound to tell out there, you know.
Okay, well, great. I'm glad that both horses ran so well. Well done. Great finish.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, Graham, we've had a very emotional trainer and owner in here. Tell us your thoughts on that.
I can't talk, honestly. It's just a fairy tale, dreams. It's a dream. It's everything. I can't believe it. I'm not going to be much use, you know, because he ain't going to get a whole lot out of me.
Don't worry. Such a brave horse. I mean, you rode him last year, third last year, and winner. And what a brave heart at the end.
He was so tough, and I didn't have a very good passage down over the first six, and with loose horses, and I think I don't jump Beechers first time from a standstill. And he got a little bit of a fright, so I just punted away in him and never even thought of winning, and just to get his confidence back, and he was so brave. All I did was steer him. That's all I did.
Gonna have a party tonight? A big one?
Yeah, I'd imagine so.
Okay, congratulations, Graham. Okay, well, if you want to find out now exactly what happened to your horse in the 2004 Martel Grand National, well, we can now see the rerun. We can join Lydia, Scoo, Richard and Norman for that.
Well, we'll sit. Well, we'll certainly do our best for you. There's two furlongs, slightly downhill all the way to the start. The first of 30 fences, it's 4'6" tall, and 36 have departed at this fence in the last 10 years. It's an average of 3.6 fallers, and it performed exactly to type. We lost three at the first fence. Arctic Jack fell, Luskadoo fell, and Kalami was brought down.
But the biggest point here is most of the jocks boys lining up towards middle to outer.
That's right, they're all aware that Beaches is catching them on the inner, but let's just watch them. Norman just going over here.
Yes, Al Capone bang up there, and also Hedge Hunter, who ran such a cracking race, and
Kalami was brought down, I think, by Luskadoo, you know?
Yeah, he was brought down by Luskadoo's fall ahead of him, and he, of course, is in the same colours as the winner, Amberleigh House.
Amazing result, one at the first and then he wins it. But just looking at this photograph in the fence there, you can see some of them really standing up because they're going fast.
Yeah, there's David's lad just going over at the back there.
And it's speed that brings them down, isn't it? Because yeah, they overjump.
It's always the best angle. You'll see a whole lot of them, their noses on the floor. Look there, that jockey.
It is speed
right out of the thing, blowing wind going over there.
There goes Luskadoo falling, and it's down, his fall that brings down Kalami. Always the fence that claims the most horses. Usually, this is always the fence that claims the most horses. This is one last view of the first.
This is Alexander Banquet on the inside. He's jumped it well. That's bounced back on the inside, just nodding a little bit. And there's Clan Royal already beginning to take a big.
And there you can see Kalami brought down just there, brought down by the fall of Luskadoo. Here we go, head on to the second fence, 4'7", and it tends to be, it's relatively unusual to have a faller here, and again, it performed to type, no fallers.
Yeah,
racing on to the first big test now, the ditch, and here we lose Shadami.
Yeah, Shardam, and seated his rider, your son, top forward.
Just wanted to see what happens. Goes 1, 2, 3, just jumps into the fence, doesn't he, and shoots him out over his head.
He gave him no chance whatsoever, Skew. He won't be. That wasn't his fault. But isn't it a big disappointment to go so soon in a race? All you want to do is for it to stop and start again.
Yes, but that's it's the nature of the game, isn't it? They're there to be jumped.
As Royal Cartels are coming through, and the eventual winner is actually towards the rear for that particular race.
Yeah, there he is at the back. We can see Graham was saying he had a bad run. I can't see that he's having much trouble yet.
Fence number four, and we have Duranson leads us at fence number four. There he is in the foreground of the shot. Tony McCoy catapulted to the ground.
But he nearly brought down the eventual winner.
Yeah, Amberleigh House had to go very, very clever there, wasn't he? Did a sidestep right-handed. All the horses are okay, so that's good
news. Excellent
news. Let's hope all the jockeys are as well.
Well, heading on to fence five, we lost Duranson at the previous fence, but no fallers at fence five. And again, very few. There is Amberleigh House jumping at the back on the outside. Just in shot, you can see his little white noseband just slightly in shot, but at this point Al Capone is leading, Alexander Banquet is on the inside, and they're heading towards Beaches.
And Gunnar Welburn's well up there too, having a good ride.
Pontal of Martin Pipes, who was a two-miler novice, ran an absolute cracker just in behind Al Capone. Hedgehunter ran just a little bit keen, and I believe this is Beaches.
That's Accurist who goes first, isn't it?
Yeah, we lose nine at this particular fence. In fact, what's up, Dan? Boys is brought down, Accurist falls, Montreal hits the deck, Bindery also hits the deck, Bramble Hill Duke falls, Acheris falls, Bounce Back also falls, Blowing Wind refuses, Skycab falls, and Montreal falls. So Beaches Brook claims its typical number of horses at that fence.
But the thing that started it off, Acheris actually tried to refuse, you know.
Did he?
He's just towards the left of the picture in the diamonds, yellow and blue.
There's Amberleigh House on the back. Well, let's roll and let's see how they all go over it.
Alexander Banquet on the right-hand side, going the very shortest way around.
That's Gunnar Welborn in the sheepskin noseband. Akers gets blinded there, doesn't he? The loose horse goes across him, gives him absolutely no chance, and then starts the carnage, really, doesn't it?
The other one unseated, I believe, was Bramble Hill Duke, right at the back. The horse ran straight across.
An old Blowing Wind, look, has said, I don't want to do this.
Sad enough, he's been third twice. He was eight last year, and this time he didn't want to go any further. And there is Amberleigh House in the noseband, not the one nearest your screen, the one just leaving the screen now with the black and red and white colours.
And you watch, if we get the angle here, you can see Amberleigh House. He lands very, very slowly from this fence because of all the carnage in the inside. There he is, look at there. He more or less trots away from the fence, as Graham said.
Lots of them down on their nose at that fence.
Skycab's jockey there gets out of the way very, very quickly.
And also Carl Llewellyn, obviously, he was fancying his chances with Bindery. And as you said, he's made mistakes at Beaches before, and this year at Clevedon.
That's Richard Johnson in short.
Bindery falling at Beaches Brook, and the result is a bloody Carl Llewellyn. Carl, you earned a lot of stripes from your colleagues, though.
Well, he didn't actually fall, he brought down. It was a horse in front of him on take-off side, but he had nowhere to go. So he did well to even take off, because he'd been fully a bit wiser to even refuse, because the horse right in front of him.
Did you remember anything after you fell?
Sorry?
Did you remember anything after you hit the deck?
Yeah, I watched the race afterwards, yeah. I remember a lot.
Thanks for talking to us, Carl.
Thank you.
Well, we'll pick it up again, leaving. So Bindery, Carl's corrected as he actually was brought down at Beaches Brook, the sixth fence. But this is fence seven, Foynavon. And 4'6" fence, and only five horses have gone here in the last 10 years. And today it doesn't claim anyone at all.
And the reason it does claim horses is because it's the smallest fence on the course after Beaches Brook. It comes as a big surprise.
Al Capone in front, he's jumped super. He's given the a lead to Hedgehunter, who was running keen. Gunnar Welborn, Lord Attenbury ran a smasher. Yes, there's old Smarty, he ran a cracker. Bear on board. Exit to Wave just going through. David Slad is alongside the winner, travelling super. Amberleigh House.
Royal Italian was the last one going through the shot, and you see that no horses were claimed at the canal turn.
Already Joss Naylor, one of the co-favourites, is struggling out the back. Here we've got the canal turn. They jump this superbly well, don't they?
Hedgehunter is the one that really rushes up here to join Al Capone in front. Puntal is still prominent. Lord Atterbury is also prominent.
Alexander Banquet was the one who nearly unseated his rider there.
There goes Amberleigh House, the winner through the shot there in the white white noseband in front of you, almost in the centre of your screen.
Now, they jumped this fence as it should be jumped, Norman.
Yes, the lads rode it very, very clever here. Hedgehunter just ran keen and ran off the bend a little bit. Now you see Alexander Banquet very nearly went down the inner. Takagi with the blinkers just jumping on the inner there is close. There's Joss Naylor bang down the inner, Paul Carberry. David's lad just wide of him, following the winner, Amberleigh House. They're just beginning to creep a little closer, Graham Lee and the winner.
And we can have a jockey's eye view of this. This is from Tony Dobbin on Gunnar Welburn. Horse is pulled up later on in the course, but now we can see them heading towards, and you can see that angle to try and get that perpendicular left-hand turn, Norman. You can see the jockeys in front trying to get the best way.
As close as you can, you want to be rubbing your boot off the white rail on the left. Really good punt, and he's only a small horse jumping brilliant upsides on the right, which you could lose 10 links at that bend if you went straight on.
But you go with Valentine's.
This is Valentine's coming up and heading towards that race. That fence, exit to wave, was pulled up prior to Valentine's, but the fence itself didn't actually claim anyone, and Hedgehunter led at that point.
He's putting in a tremendous round, this horse. Willie Mullins sold him to Trevor Hemmings only a year ago, and I should think he was very pleased with the way he's going.
There's last year's winner, Monty Pass, just going through your screen. The winner just coming through at the back of the screen there.
That was fence 10, and there were no fallers at that fence either. There was only claimed three horses in the past 10 years, so quite a quiet fence as usual. Back to Hedgehunter in the lead and heading towards the 11th there.
And this second time round catches horses out because they're tired. But you can see a loose horse in the ditch there, but he's okay. Here's the winner.
It only catches a loose horse in this case. There is Amberleigh House, just below, underneath our caption on the left-hand side of the screen. That is where the winner has to come from, all the way back there. But there are no fallers at that fence.
Let's take another shot from this side then, and you can see that there is plenty of fight there, because they've got a stretch to get over the fence.
Wonder Weasel going through. Very, very lucky to stand up. He gave it a right clout. There's Joss Naylor now. He's struggling from that point.
He'd been struggling for some way, really, hadn't he? He never really got into the race at all.
Some of these horses just don't take to the fences, and he was one of them. But the ones up here in front are really beginning to thing, and that's Lord Attenbury this side. He gave Mark Bradman a fabulous ride.
No fallers at this particular fence. Again, it's quite a quiet fence, but Al Capone did make a blunder up front.
The other horse that I keep seeing in the picture that interested me, was going very well when he fed, was Le Coudre. Even with his big weight, you'll see him in the middle of the pack there somewhere, and he's been jumping very well and travelling very well.
And the reason he wasn't up there is because of the weight. They wanted to give him the chance to get home. But they now start to steady up, They've gone a good gallop, they were spread out, and now as they come onto the race course proper again, as we call it, they consciously slow the pace.
Yes, David Casey in front, he'd have been very, very worried. Hedgehunter running too keen, and he'd be anxious to pull it up. We'll notice after this fence the loose horses begin to take him on, which didn't help. But he's going along at his own pace. Puntal's second, Lord Attenbury just behind him. Al Capone ran a cracker just in behind him. Then you've Gunnar Welburn and Alexander Banquet. But sure, we get the other shot. We'll see Graham Lee on the winner just creeping close.
There's horses past the last year's winner at the tail of the leading group. There were no fallers at fence 13. There were none at 14 either. As we gallop on, again, it's a relatively quiet fence.
But the big worry here is going to the chair, loose horses are everywhere.
There, just on the edge of your picture is the eventual winner, Amberleigh House. Still a long way back, Norman, and Ginger McCain was concerned. He was in fact too far back, wasn't he?
Yeah, but they went a really good gallop up front, and they didn't stop till the elbow, but they did stop, which he was very lucky. But this is the chair, horse in front puts himself right, absolutely perfect. Al Capone stood a mile off and hit it very hard. We'll get a better shot of that in a minute. That's Takagi going. Davy Russell out over his head. I have to, I'm sorry, Davy, but you're unseated.
Yeah, definite unseating. Unseating at the chair.
You're a very hard man, Roger. Norman. Here's another view of it. You can just see them getting in closer. There's Hedgehunter.
Now you'll watch Al Capone where he stands off. There you go. Very lucky to get it out to the other side. Here we'll see Takagi coming now. There you go. He's the far side. Dropped his back end. It wasn't even unseated. There's no possible way he could have stayed on. But thankfully, I believe he's back in the weigh room smiling, so that's good news. That's Joss Naylor just going through. Very lucky to stand up also.
Well, you mentioned your criticism of David Russell, your fact that you thought he was unseated. He gets a chance to answer back in a moment, as soon as we just have a last look. There's Hedgehunter going over, Puntal, also Lord Attenbury. There goes Al Capone making a little bit of a blunder. Gunnar Welburn coming over, Alexander Banquet on the inside.
And just look to the left of the picture now, you'll see Monty's Pass. There's the foyer, you won't get back from that. But Monty's Pass has been coming quietly. What did Davey think of that, I wonder?
Yes, David Russell saying it may be a little unfair to call that unseated, Davey. I mean, there wasn't much chance of staying in the saddle.
No, I had very little chance in it. I think Edward is running him next year, so Lydia, we might be calling you up next year to ride him. So,
yeah, a few of the lads giving you a bit of stick, but how was Takagi going at the time?
Yeah, I was just starting to get into a rhythm. I had all the right horses around me at the time, and he just left his hind legs inside in the ditch, and it was good night Irene after that.
Okay, David, thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
Heading towards the water now, the smallest fence on the course, and you won't catch me riding over even this one, I have to tell you. We get no fallers at this particular fence yet again, but Clan Royal steals up and makes some significant progress.
But the mindset at this point is, I've survived one round. Okay, now we'll start playing jockeys. Will we conserve stamina? Will we kick on? These are the decisions.
Yeah, and when they went round this bend, they conserved energy. The jockey of David Casey and Hedge Hunter eased up and tried to get some wind in the horse's lungs. They've known they've gone a good gallop. Clan Royal has come right up there as well. Liam Cooper doesn't want to be. They know they've gone too quick, don't they?
Yes, they know they've gone too quick. And like Richard said, this is when you begin to enjoy it. And really, you know, it's now a Grand National and you start to look around and see where your pals are or whatever else. But heading out on the second circuit, David Casey really has to make a conscious decision to pull up in front and try and get the trip.
But just prior to that fence, Mantle's Prince was pulled up. So Mantle's Prince doesn't set out for a second circuit. But they're heading for the second circuit, heading back to the first fence where they began, Richard.
Yes, and Headhunter put in a magnificent round, both standing off when he met fences on long strides and being able to get in close. You would almost guarantee at this point that he would get home.
Yes, the only thing I think the jockeys here, David Casey would love to be left alone in front now, wouldn't he? But they're just taking each other on again, aren't they?
Taking each other on, and also the loose horses weren't helping him, just rushing him a little. Because he slowed down, Clan Royal, obviously, we'll see in a minute, just running too keen, right behind him. And Amberleigh House, he's just at the back of your picture, just beginning to creep a little bit closer.
That little loose horse is Bounce Back who falls, which is a very unusual thing for a loose horse to fall.
There goes Alexander Bancook falling there, on the inside at the back, and also before that rate, that fence 18. Southern Star was also pulled up. So Alexander Bancook was the one that we lost there. This is fence 19.
Pontal went absolutely, well, he did on seat, but had no chance of staying on him either. Got a horrible fall, Pontal.
But the big change is that Clan Royal is now actually running away and getting there quicker than he needs to.
Yeah, and Liam Cooper, he's running there, and he's still, but he's having to give him a kick at his fences, isn't he? Because you just can't sit still here, and there's Pontal going.
There goes Pontal and seating Danny Howard.
Okay.
Also pulled up before that particular fence was Joss Naylor. We saw him jumping the water in virtually last place, and he does pull up just before this fence.
Tal's are starting to get in it. He'd been tailed off early and just starting to creep there for the charity that Clay Ramsden was off. That is a big jump.
Fantastic jumping. That's Al Capone just putting him down a bit. There's the winner, Amberleigh House, creeping into the race, and just behind him is Le Coudre. As they say, I felt he was going very well when he got rid of his rider. They parted company at Beaches.
And just going up to the 20th, Gunnar Welburn was pulled up. Last year's fourth was pulled up heading towards the 20th fence. This is the 21st, and there are no fallers at the 21st. And again, it's very, very few horses do tend to go here at this stage in the race. They're just sort of settling down. They can see things much more clearly.
There's a big jump from the horse in the middle here, Clan Royal. He sort of really gets there. Into the race.
But as I say, with Liam, he's holding him back, but when he gets to a fence, he has to kick and make him jump. Look,
what's the third place horse in the blue colours? Lord Atterbury makes a big mistake here. Down on his nose, good recovery, but we also lose Le Coudre.
That's Le Coudre. There he goes. Conor Dwyer shot straight out over his head, but I would have to put that down as a fall rather than
a
just got in too close.
Can I tell you something interesting? The loose horse fell again. That's the third time that Bounce Back's fallen in the same race.
I won't take the ride in him next year, Richard. Don't worry about that.
I couldn't have Le Coudre as unseated unless you're asking a horse to roll over and, you know, that's fallen, isn't it?
Right, I think we'd definitely say so. And fall for Le Coudre, not unseated. Nobody else need lynch me for that particular call.
His stomach was on the ground at one time, anyway, the horses.
There's Beaches Brook. 12 fallers in the last 10 years at this fence. Second time round, that's a 1.2 average, which compares pretty similarly to the first time round.
Here's Le Coudre, look.
Just the drop caught him out, and he left half a leg out at the fence, and down he goes.
More horses tend to, more jockeys tend to be unseated than fallen.
But interesting, isn't it, to see how jockeys are looking carefully and quite controlled to look where others are going from instead of lying there waiting for the bomb.
Here's another angle. Obviously, because of the angle of the fence, they're going to run down it a little bit. There's the winner at the back there. We'll be able to watch
the white sheepskin noseband.
To the left of the marker there as we look at the picture.
I'm sorry, Scoo, but I think that's David's lad. The winner is right in the middle of the picture with the white breast skirt and white noseband. And Hedgehunter in front, Clanroy, Lord Attenbury, Bear on board, and there's the winner you can see right in the middle. And Monty's Pass creeping closer down the inner with another white noseband. He ran an absolute cracking race.
But let's just see how they just start to drift as we look at it right-handed, there left-handed. It's something that happens because the course bends that way.
That's right. There is here we've got Monty's Pass coming over now. He's been put perfectly.
Bear on board.
Yeah, there's the Coudray Garn. Smarty, he knows his way around here.
We keep showing Connor a drive. This particular fall, he doesn't want to see it again, I don't think.
It's the Bunny Byler, the last horse to jump it.
Yep. And look, Connor, looking back and thinking what might have been.
This is fence 23. We leave Beaches finally, Connor. We head towards fence 23, Point Avon for the second time. And here we lose just in debt further down the field. He's going to come through any moment.
Talza just coming through. Let's have another look then, see if we can pick him up. Hunter on the inside, turning all the time. Clan Royal next to him.
They're on board going through there. Last year's winners, Monty's Pass, also jumping there. There's the winner creeping forward, and the horse for the way. Well, let's just have a look at the fall of Justin Day. He's just coming up now. He's
enormous. Fallen in midair. Yeah.
Did he get knocked? He looked as if the horse behind him sort of knocked him out of the way.
The horse had nowhere to jump to.
Now, what people must really look for at the canal turn is two different ways of jockeys jumping this, and in the end, it's Liam Cooper on Clanroy who takes a different route who comes out best.
That's right. He doesn't take it quite as sharp and fiddles it a little bit more, and for that, he's able to turn sharp on the inside of Hedgehunter.
But Lord Atterby makes another mistake. He's been making little mistakes all the way around, and Mark Bradburn does well to sit.
Just getting a little bit low, but also Mark Bradburn rode the canal turn absolutely brilliant. He turned it real quick.
And this gives us a better look at it, doesn't it? Now see how they change positions here. Hedgehunter on the inner, but as they come out landing, the way Cooper's gone, look, up through the middle.
There goes the winner, jumping through in sixth place. Bear on board in fourth position at that point. Monty's Pass is also with them. This is the last view of the canal turn, that left perpendicular turn. There again, you see the recovery of Mark Bradburn as he just brushes through the top on Lord Atterbury.
But Graham Leno has got 15 lengths to make up there.
Quite a long way back, but the horses in front, as we said, they've been racing one another, and it's a long way from home here.
Fence 25, Valentine's second time round, we lose Al Capone. He's pulled up before this particular fence. This is the 26th now. Good recovery from Liam Cooper on Clan Royal there, Norman.
Absolutely, he was very, very lucky. Liam gave him a squeeze and said come up, and he said no thanks, and he did miracles to find a leg.
Lord Atterbury also made a small mistake, but we didn't lose any there. This is the last ditch that we see. And another small mistake by Lord Atterbury, but no fallers.
Yeah, he keeps just rushing through. It must have cost him a lot of energy, Lord Atterbury, isn't he? I mean, that's the last three or four fences we've seen he's made a mistake. And you just feel, didn't the three of us just felt, coming to the end of these fences, that these horses were tired. You were looking to see what was behind, what was going to come on and take them on.
That was fence 28. And Wonder Weasel is the one that pulls up before there. He got a lot further than he did last time.
Do you know what is deceptive here? Clan Royal is a very heavy-headed horse. His head is down, and it looks as if he's running away and going better than he actually is.
Yeah, and I'd say a difficult horse to ride, to be quite honest. I think Liam Cooper does a good job on him. He's a very big horse.
Has he dropped his whip?
Yes, it looks as though he had, but he ran all over the shop after the last. Lord Attenbury coming between the two, he looked like he was going to win here, and David Casey on the outside is still trying to spare a little bit with Hedgehunter, but really the petrol hand is right down in the red.
And again, Lord Attenbury gets in close to that one, doesn't he? He keeps just losing a bit at every single one.
Do you think, Norman, that in a perfect world, Liam would not want to be in front of Clan Royal yet, but because he's taken him there, he's made the decision, I've just got to go now.
I think he just left him roll along. There wasn't a lot he could do. Now, he was very, very lucky. That's the final fence. Hedgehunter falls, but Clan Royal very lucky. Just the winner, Amberleigh House, creeping into the picture on the wide outside.
Yeah, let's just...
Here's David Casey. Here's a view of David Casey. He's currently lying in third place. Mistake by Clan Royal, but there's David Casey. Tired horse, Hedgehunter, falls at the last. And we can actually hear from him. him. There he is. Just having a good look to see whether Hedge Hunter gets up all right. We can confirm, just to repeat, that all the horses are fine. Let's go and join Rishi, who's got David Casey.
Yes, David, was it a tired fall or was it just a bad mistake?
Yeah, no, he was just tired. He'd given me everything all the way. He'd just been too keen in front. Plenty of horses around him, and he was enjoying it. I was enjoying it, but feel so bad for the horse. He didn't deserve it, you know.
There was no chance of him getting back into the race at that stage?
No, as I say, I was getting tired, but I felt the two in front of me didn't have a whole pile left either, you know. I couldn't guarantee what horse was coming behind me, but all the way I got such a super ride. Really enjoyed myself, the horse enjoyed it, I think. I'm sure he'll come back again for another couple of goes, but hopefully it won't have left his mark on him.
You didn't do too badly, well done up to that point.
Super, thank you.
Well, David may have been out of it, but you can see Clan Royal on the inside, and then Lord Atterbury next to him. He dives at that. That's a tired horse's mistake. Out goes Hedge Hunter. Now, at this stage, Norman Williamson said the third horse wins.
Yeah, I really did. Skew was shouting at the horse in front that he was going to go the wrong course. He did just go drift in the wrong direction. Difficult for Liam Cooper, big heavy-headed horse. But this is where Graham Lee wins the race. He took the direct route from the last fence to the line. Lord Atterbury coming between the two, he'd every chance, but full marks to Amberleigh House, as tough as nails from here to the line, and they're three very, very tired horses.
He's a very complete jockey, isn't he, Graham Lee? He's not a big man, and for that he can sit very neat and tidy in his horses. As we talk about, he's not flapping about in the horse, he's keeping him well balanced, and he's riding out well to the line.
And you know, John Haywood, who owns this, his business is only 3 miles from the racecourse. What a local win for him.
Well, what a difference a couple of days make. Claire and myself have been having emails about Graham Lee, and said he should have won an English Drever and all the rest. Now he's a winner for Grand National. He's the greatest man in Aintree this evening.
And did you see that he crossed himself as he crossed the line? He made the sign of the cross, and he's saying thank you very much, Lord.
He was expected to ride lots of top horses, wasn't he? And he's managed to win on the fourth Grand National for Ginger McCain on Amberleigh House. Third last year, wins it this time round, and woof, he's enjoying it. But on the other side of the coin, Liam Cooper in second place. He was on Clan Royal, an excellent race he rode, but still he was beaten. He's now with Rishi.
Yes, a heartbreaking moment for Liam Cooper. It looked for a long way as if he was going to be the one to beat Liam.
Definitely a fantastic ride. I'm delighted for Amberleigh House and all connections, and Graham Lee there, as nobody deserves it more than him after the Beecher chase.
Was there a moment during the latter part of the race where you thought, I've got this?
Yeah, once he gets to the front, he pricks his ears there, and he only does enough. So I was happy there. He got a bit of a breather into him. Could have just done with a bit of a lead there over the last two fences, but it's the way it goes, isn't it?
I hope this isn't too silly. How do you feel after just getting touched off?
Sick as a pig, but I'm also delighted there to get around there and to finish second in such a big race.
Liam, well done anyway.
Thanks very much.
There's Liam, terrible for him really, but Norman remembers it was the other way round, wasn't it, in November?
The Beecher's chase, it's amazing, you know, there was only a couple of inches in it, same two horses, same two riders, but I'm sure Liam Cooper would swap the Beecher's for the National.
Yeah, I'm afraid that's true. Well, let's confirm the full order of finish for you. First was Amberleigh House at 16-1, number 17. Second was number 27, Clan Royal, the 10-1 co-favourite. Third was number 33, Lord Atterbury at 40-1, Mark Bradburn was on board. Fourth, number two, last year's winner, Monty's Pass at 20-1 for Barry Geraghty. Fifth was Spot the Difference on Richard McGrath. Sixth was Smarty for Andrew Tinkler. Seventh was Ardent Scout for Warren Marston. Eighth was Bear on board for Robert Thornton. In ninth place was King's Mark, Mick Fitzgerald on board. Russ Geraghty was in 10th on the Dwayne Boiler, and he did well to persevere that long. And in last, 11th place was Timmy Murphy on David's Lad. That's three less finishers than last year, but the same as 2002.
Tremendous race, and what a story this is. Ginger McCain, his fourth Grand National. And who'd have thought he'd have got back after those marvellous years with Red Rum? The Princess Royal, delighted, great horseman herself. And would you have thought that Ginger would survive the agony of watching his horse come from so long behind? Lord Darsbury in the background, and John Halewood's mother there just congratulating Graham Lee. And there is John Halewood, Leon Breton, the Chief Executive Officer, doing the presenting. Judy Eaton in the red.
Well, Angus, good result for the layers.
Well, I think, yeah, I haven't heard a bookie complaining. I mean, I think it's one of those results where it could have been a lot worse, it could have been a lot better, but, I mean, the Liverpool bookies would have been really hammered by it, wouldn't they?
Yeah, and of course, it's a case again for horses with, you know, good course form coming back again. Monty's Pass has run a blind. There must have been plenty of each way money for him.
Oh, for sure, yeah, Monty's Pass has run a blind, and, you know, Clan Royal has run a blind, and we just wondered whether it might have even tried to go the wrong way at the end there on the run, and it was amazing, wasn't it? A record for the Tote. The Tote have taken a record on the win and the place pool, but I mean, you know, a great, great day. But it never disappoints, does it, the Marcel Conyan?
And you've been past some prices for next year already?
Yeah, 33 to 1 the field, so that's why how open it is.
Thanks, Angus.
Well, welcome back to the winner's enclosure here in Connacht. We're delighted. Monty's Pass has run an absolute blinder under 11 stone, 10 pounds, finishing fourth. Well done to Jimmy Mangan and all the punters here. They're delighted. They're back. Monty's Pass each way.
Well, they're celebrating there, but they'll be celebrating here in Liverpool. I mean, we talk about a story every year, but this is a fairy tale ending, isn't it?
Absolutely extraordinary. Ginger McCain has been telling us since 2001, when he first ran Amberleigh House in the Grand National, one day we will come back and we will win this. He finished third last year. Comes from a mile back. It's the ground that he's made up that's so extraordinary. I mean, he was sort of back in the last two-thirds of the field, nearly the whole way around the race, and Graham Lee has just been so patient. And as Norman said, coming to the last, you still fancied Amberleigh House to make up that ground because he's a real out-and-out stayer. Incredible performance.
And it's great that all the horses have come home safely. Yeah. There's no serious injuries to the jockeys as well. That
no,
is great
and particularly
news.
Hedge Hunter, who fell at the last, who'd run so bravely for a long time. He was badly winded, but he did get up and he's fine. And one other horse to mention, Lord Atterbury, who finished third for Martin Pike, being trained for most of the time by his son, David. And Mark Bradburn, who rode him, missed out on riding his mother's horse, Blue Charm, in 1990, finished second. He's got a great, great ride there from Lord Asprey and finished third.
Actually, I say no serious injuries. I mean, Tom Scudamore has gone to a hospital. He had an X-ray, suspected broken wrist.
Yeah, he had a pretty heavy fall there on Chardin. They are tough guys, though, these jockeys. You saw Tony McCoy, who had a horrible fall on Durandson. He was in the back of shot in the jockey's room. But Amberleigh House, just extraordinary. Look at him after running up 4.5 miles. He's, I should think he's feeling pretty tired.
It was nothing,
now.
He said. But it is absolutely amazing because third last year and winner this time, and also reversing the form of the Beecher chase.
Absolutely. And the other thing for Ginger McCain, you think how many years he's been coming here to Aintree, and the only thing he's ever talked about is Red Rum, Red Rum, Red Rum, and quite rightly so. Now he's gone and won the National again with Amberleigh House. I just think it's an amazing performance from him as a trainer, from the horse, and from Graham Lee.
Because we always say, you know, 27 years it was since Red Rum won his third National here, and Ginger McCain, he just never gave up hope, did he? I mean, it's such an inspiration to everybody.
He's such a positive guy, and he's always come on and been bullish about his horses. And, you know, people may have doubted Amberleigh House's speed or class, but it doesn't matter in the Grand National. You know, they stay on, and I've always thought Amberleigh House is a cracking good horse anyway, over pretty much any distance, as he's proved in the Beecher Chase. And I just think it's, you know, we talked about what stories might unfold, and this is the best story of the lot, and I'm thrilled. I thought it was a great race. You know, I'm glad all the horses are all right, because some of those falls really did look heavy, but just sensational action.
It certainly was, Claire. Thank you very much. So that is it. We knew there was going to be a story, but we didn't believe it would be a fairy tale ending, but it was for Ginger McCain and Amberleigh House. It's been another day to remember here at Aintree. From all of us, goodbye.